go and look at our very first matchup of the day between SK Gaming and Rocket. Starting off on the blue side with SK Gaming's lineup, Freddy122, Svenskeren, Fox, Candy Panda, and Raiden, and their coach, Lukas Schenke. Well, SK, they're on the board. They got their very first win, but it took a lot.
It took a lot. I mean, Unicorns love that game. It was very back and forth. We see basically what won SK the game, Freddy and Svenskeren here in the late game team fights on both Gnar and then Echo. Of course, being very tanky, but also being the carries for SK, and it says a lot about what these two guys can do. I mean, just look at the amount of damage Freddy dealt. Of course, it was Frozen Mallet, Black Cleaver, Hexstringer. It's a bit of a DPS Gnar. Not a full Wicked style, though, with the Hurricane. Maybe that comes today.
Yeah, definitely the case. And I think for SK, they broke their losing streak. We heard Candy Panda talking about that and how important it was. And I also think for Svenskeren, his 7th champion in 7 games, he had a very, very good impact in the early game. Found first blood, was stealing jungle camps, high kill participation. That's the first time this split Sven has looked like the Sven that was at Worlds, the Sven that was performing so well in the spring split.
Yeah, I think one of the problems they had in that game as well, they were using Caitlyn kind of like a Wayne. Like, he was just split pushing instead of grouping early mid game, where it's actually Caitlyn can be useful at pushing those turrets. Although he did a really good job of baiting the enemy team later on in the game.
I think we still saw some mistakes, obviously, from SK and also from Unicorns of Love, which is what we see quite often now, at least at the moment for them. They're not really performing too well. So I think SK can just look at this game and say, hey, it wasn't pretty, but we managed to win. We broke our losing streak. I mean, I've been 0-9, you've been, what, 0-7, or at least lost 7 games in a row. So getting that first win, you know, it means a lot because you get some sort of confirmation that you're not complete trash at least. And that's what you need as a team when you're losing so much.
I don't think you could compare the Fnatic losing streak.
Hey, 7 games in a row, 9 games in a row. It's the same.
I don't recall a losing streak ever.
It's the same.
No, never happened. Moving on, we're going to go across the other side of the rift. There is Rocket, SK's opponent in this one, with Steve, Jankos, Nukeduck, Vander, and their new AD carry, Mr. Rawls, and of course their coach, Yamato Cannon. We see strolling there behind them now. Well, yesterday, Mr. Rawls came in there. He pulled out the Corki in the very first game, a mid-game focused comp from Rocket, but just missing their power spikes.
Yeah, it was kind of weird watching Rocket play here because the comp they ran, it's fairly simple what it has to do. Your AD carry gets a Trinity Force, you get one item on your Lulu, and you start poking and sieging away. You have Steve split pushing. Instead, as we just saw in this clip here, they started team fighting 4v5. They allowed elements to sit and farm up, and suddenly Froggen on a Vladimir, for once, got to go late game. He ended up like 7-8-0 and just carried the team fights because Rocket did absolutely nothing in the mid game and just allowed elements to do whatever they want.
Yeah, and a huge problem with Vlad as well. Like, when he's behind, he's kind of like meh. But when Vlad gets ahead, he's like unkillable and he will also one-shot you. So it was like a huge problem. I think it's almost impossible to lose with a fed Vlad.
And I think, you know, not only misplaying the power timings of Rocket's comp yesterday, just the fact that they even tried to, you know, play late game and not be proactive at all. Yes, they had a sub. Yes, they have to adjust to an AD carry who, you know, is on the squad. But I think if they give SK the same time, they may face similar things. But both of these teams have shown a lot of decision-making errors as the weeks have rolled on.
And it's just so hard to predict which team shows up when Rocket plays here. They beat Origin last week. Great early game, you know, get a lead, snowball it from there. Then against Elements, they do absolutely nothing in the mid game. Versus SK here, I feel like Rocket can almost lose it, you know, for themselves. If they don't perform well enough, SK is going to take it.
Yeah, can't let that get in their heads. We'll see what happens. And as we check in with the caster for picks and bans, Jankos thinks SK has the tools to perform on the LCS stage. But according to him, the team has some work to do first.
About SK, I think they have the potential. Like, they are for sure not bottom three team. Like, they should be in playoffs at least, you know? They are a good team. They just need to find it. Kind of just sit down, play the game, and see how it goes. And I honestly think they will come back.
Perhaps his own team will come back as well. Hello, everybody. I'm Devin Pyrotechnus Young, and of course, I'm alongside the Belgian brother from another mother. It is Mitch Crepo Forcepulls as Rocket and SK make their final preparations going into champion selection. Crepo, excited for this one?
I'm excited. This will be a very interesting game. To both teams have a lot to prove, and both teams really need the victory against each other because SK, you know, they have a good chance of beating Rocket. Rocket have a good chance of beating SK, but later on in the season, they're going to have a lot tougher opponents. So definitely looking forward how exactly this one pans out.
Absolutely. And well, for SK at least, they've got the momentum on their side. A much needed victory yesterday.
The one game winning streak.
I mean, it's better than a game losing streak, that's for sure. Rocket, a little bit back and forth. We'll see if maybe they can snap the trend today. They've definitely seen some improvement.
Yeah, I like that SK yesterday came in with a plan. They didn't execute it to fully perfection, but at least they had a nice plan. Rocket, they came in with some decent picks, but just didn't do anything. Just slowly waited to start losing the game and eventually lost the game. So at least SK was trying to an extent.
Yep, that is what we're going to see going forward here in picks and bans. The Gragas off the board, no surprises, still continues to be very, very contested. Rek'Sai also off the table. This drops to the next tier of junglers. And also the Jace, once again, since this changes he's received on the new patch.
Yeah, Jace definitely looked strong yesterday when we saw him. Unfortunately for the Copenhagen Wolves, I think it was everything around him kind of crumbled before he came into full effect, rather. Ryze is still open, if I believe, yeah? Mm-hmm. So SK Gaming prioritizing Lee Sin over Ryze.
Interesting, interesting.
Not sure how I feel about that one.
Yeah, it's a little bit curious there. Let's see what Rocket answer with if they go ahead and snap up the Ryze for Steve right away. Of course, for him, he's not played this champion yet. He did, I want to see if they do decide to take it, but Sivir has also been something we've been talking about. It has to be very, very high prioritized for Rollins.
We could see a Sivir Maokai coming out here out of Rocket. You know, even though Maokai doesn't have the highest win rate percentage so far in the European LCS, it just seems to be a comfort pick for top laners that are quite trying to find their ground, which explains why the win rate is, you know, as low as it is, around 37%, I believe it is. So definitely not the strongest, but yeah, Rocket, I like that they're hovering Sivir, especially since that Kalista's out of there. And then Alistar, we keep saying how it's a tier 1 pick, but I actually took a look at the stats and Alistar's win rate is not as impressive as one would think. Hovering around 35.3% win rate, and for a tier 1 support pick, it either shows that the pick is overrated or people are just not using it to their full potential, because I think it's fantastic.
I think that might be the case too, because I mean, we haven't as often seen the Sivir Alistar get to combo up. A lot of teams will take one away when the other's not available. There hasn't been a lot of Sivir bans, but we have seen a lot of Alistar bans. With so much focus on the jungle here, that kind of took that away. So now SK Gaming for their side, let's see what they answer with. They already prioritized the Lee Sin since top tier junglers were banned away. And at the end of it, we're going to go ahead and lock the Lulu and lock the Cassiopeia, starting to look a lot like yesterday.
Yeah, pretty traditional SK Gaming picks here. Fox just wants that control mage in the mid lane. He's a little immobile in Cassiopeia, but Lulu support does help fixing that. You know, if you ever get caught, you have the Wild Growth knocking people up and then buys you enough time to use your ultimate.
Yes, indeed.
See what Nuketuk answers with. Also, Nuketuk hasn't been putting too much pressure in his lanes lately so far. So, yeah, Fox could actually have an advantage there.
Yeah, I think it's really going to be interesting to see how those two do match up, because we've been seeing all these crazy lane swaps, all these crazy early game moves from a lot of the teams, and the mids just kind of turned into this sort of quiet farm fest. I don't think that's going to be the case this game.
Now going back to that first pick, Lee Sin. Both tier junglers were out. SK Gaming said, okay, Jankos, we think you are one of the best players on Rocket, so we want to challenge your champion pool. You will not be able to pick Evelynn because Lee Sin traditionally does well to that. So he seems to be going for the Nidalee jungle. However, Nidalee is usually what you do for like a poke siege comp. I guess it can work when you get to the towers and you have those spears combined with the Victor E, and then you can get out with On the Hunt. However, Sivir is one of the shorter range AD carries, so getting to that tower might prove difficult, especially when you have the threat of a Cassiopeia R flash in your face.
Right, and isn't it a little bit risky too? You kind of telegraph that I need to make plays early on this Nidalee. I need to get into the enemy jungle and maybe make some plays and shut the Lee Sin down. But if it doesn't work, what then?
Well, then you obviously fall behind and your poke does less damage, but you can still group efficiently. Sivir just solves a lot of problems in a lot of team comps, but we'll have to see if that's the approach that Jankos wants to take, right? If he wants to invade the enemy jungle early, then group up with his mid lane, with his bot lane, and poke people defending out, hope they're stationary targets, poke them out, and then try and get some towers. Could be the approach, but Rocket's looking for a tank right now, so could be likely that we see another Maokai coming out of Steve later.
Well, SK Gaming, they may be are looking to do something that they saw played against them yesterday.
All right.
Got the Vayne Shed locked in for Freddy. Candy Panda will be on the Vayne.
So Cyanide on the desk was saying how Candy Panda played his Caitlyn like a Vayne, so he might as well play the Vayne himself. Oh yeah, you have the good old submarine combo. Used to be Twitch Shen, where Twitch goes invisible and then the Shen lands. Vayne can do a submarine light tumble invisibility for like 1 second. But yeah, you can protect your hyper carry in these fights pretty well. They have a decent amount of peel. I mean, Lulu will obviously get Levain through most laning phases and keep her alive in the fights. Shen is defensive peel. So very, very distinct double threat composition coming out of SK Gaming. Mm-hmm. Last time they ran that, I feel, against H2K, it was Ryu would just take out one threat immediately on his TF, and then eventually Candy Panda fell behind on that Vayne. Mm-hmm. See if he can get ahead. It does land well into Sivir, though.
Yeah, and also they've got a way to protect both the Vayne and the Cassiopeia quite well between the Shen and the Lulu. I mean, there's a lot of artificial tankiness there that you can establish, a lot of shields you can build up, and it's going to be hard for Rocket to pick a single target off, and even if that's what they're trying to do. So last pickup, of course, is going to be Steve's Gnar. Let's see how this one plays into the Shen. Start this game off.
Now, if this Gnar gets a lead, gets the Black Cleaver, then we could see a repetition of what we saw yesterday. I believe it was Freddy playing the Gnar into a Shen even. Mm-hmm. It's just showing how much pressure you can open up the map with. That might prove a little cumbersome for the SK gaining lineup. Their side lanes are under pressure a lot. If Gnar can get a lead on the Shen, and if the Vayne Lu eventually get pushed in and Nidalee joins there and starts poking on the towers, their side lane wave clear is limited to an extent. However, Rocket will eventually have to be careful in fights because there's a whole lot of sustained damage kind of Cassiopeia and Vayne as these double threats.
Yeah,
it'll be interesting.
I feel like even though they've got a very early game jungler in the Lee Sin, it's really just going to serve as a bridge to get them to this later stage, see if that's what they can pull off. We know Rocket typically have had some longer games, but of course, it's been a little inconsistent from them. Their win over Origin was quick, but I don't know. I feel like SK, they're experimenting a little bit and they're trying to do it. So let's take a look as things get started. Of course, if you guys want to let us know at home who you think is going to walk away with this one, go ahead and tweet us at LOL Esports. It is hashtag SKWin or hashtag ROCWin as we're getting ready to get into the game. Between Rocket and SK Gaming, both these teams, they need a win, that's for sure. Why don't you guys at home start making some noise? The crowd certainly is here. We're about ready to load up onto the Rift.
Yeah, I think it will be less composition-based this game, but rather just the level of play we'll see and the strategy involved. Both teams have shown lapses in judgment when it comes to game-wide plays, strategy across the board. I think both lineups could win this game. Just all comes down to the play. Eventually, every game has to be played.
Well, what I really want to know is assuming we get standard lanes in the situation, which it looks like we're starting to, unless you know some craziness happens in the next few moments, how does this Sivir Alistar lane really how is it really going to try and push and punish Candy Panda and Raida back to keep the Vayne from getting rolling? Really?
It usually doesn't, actually. Sivir lanes well into Vayne, and then you have the disparity of a melee range support into a poke sustain support like Lulu. Obviously, sustain doesn't really sustain, but you know it has the shields to prevent damage, so you can call it a bit of a poke sustain lane. Mm-hmm. It should be fine. Honestly, I expect him to go even CS, if not a slight advantage on the Vayne even. Vander's going in here for the ward.
Yep, speaking of Vander. You know, he had some pretty big setups, and I want to go back to the game against Origin because his Nautilus play was actually quite impressive, but this Alistar too, it's still some playmaking potential. I think a lot's going to be on him in this mid-game, especially to see what he can do against SK to, again, to try and keep them from going forward. Take a look at his stats on Alistar, though.
Yeah, and they're gonna lane swap too right now because they want to dodge that laning phase. I don't think Vayne is a good matchup for Sivir Alistar, so they want to dodge out. And yeah, here we see Vander with his stats so far. Yeah, a little above the average of the supports in KDA. I think he's a good player, Vander.
He's
one of the few shining lights on Rocket.
He contributes a fair amount of damage as far as supports go. He's one of the higher ranked ones on that regard. But of course, that's not always a good thing. Sometimes you're saying your support has to do most of the damage.
He wards a lot. Keeps a lot of vision up for the Rocket lineup. On losing teams, that's incredibly hard to do with your vision control. So,
all right.
Krug's being done by both teams here. Initiated
lane. So how are they
doing it? They're doing it fine. There's no wrong or right way to do it when you only have one AoE ability. So Candy Panda clears it up, gets the gold. But he's going to walk into an empty lane, whereas Freddy right now, he's stuck in the traditional SK lane swap style. Freddy doesn't start double jungle. He's sitting in that lane. And usually people with a good idea of how to lane swap will end up punishing Freddy for this. But they have to move four people to the top side of the map and just dive him straight. If SK wants to prevent this for once, Enraided always has the base almost right now. But even then, if they see Enraided, then Steve can teleport in return, you know, to the bot lane. So it's a very complex, you know, material. However, Freddy got to level 2 early. And that might actually, with the assist from Svenskun, he might actually be able to prevent that dive. So.
Yeah, so
something,
let's see. Vander just keeps knocking away from this farm. They're going to try to keep Freddy as down as they possibly can. He'll be able to sustain a little bit through the Doran shield, but yeah, it could be a rough start for him. Meanwhile, Steve's still hanging around with Yankos, just double jungled up, but they are moving towards the top side.
I mean, neither lane froze, so both teams can see what's going to happen, right? They see both lanes pushing towards that one tier one tower, so very predictable line of play coming in. SK should definitely expect a dive on the top lane, 100% guaranteed. Rocket should expect that SK is expecting it. But it doesn't seem.
Not sure.
SK is actually expecting it.
Yeah, Freddy looks to start backing away, but there's Jankos and Steve heal up. He's going to dash his way. Spear's going to connect. In comes Jankos. Do they have enough damage? Flash from Freddy. And he's back to tower, but now we've got 4v0 on this top side for Rocket. Two down on the bottom for SK.
Now, obviously, Steve can't teleport to the bot lane either because he's so afraid of getting condemned into wall. And he doesn't know where Svenskeren is. That's a problem. The difference right now is that Svenskeren in this SK lane swap style gets a bit of an experience lead usually over Jankos because he's solo jungler. Because Jankos was double jungling with Steve. But Freddy, you know, he lost a lot of his summoners there. He lost some pressure. He's losing some experience, so he might be slightly behind. And in that crucial side lane Gnar Chen matchup, that might actually prove difficult later on for SK Gaming.
Yeah, SK definitely gonna have to be a little bit extra careful, especially teams, you know, have been able to figure them out so far this split. And this is a team that for a long time, this last couple of weeks, they've struggled for an identity. And now, well, they picked up the one win, but following forward on Rocket here, they do seem to be a little bit behind the curve.
Yeah, and we should normally see both tier 1 towers going down here with a bounce wave, meaning after you kill the tower, you manipulate the waves in a fashion that they push back towards your tier 1, and you make it incredibly hard to farm for the person that will show up. However, Candy Panda hasn't taken down a tower on the bot lane yet. He's waiting for an item spike. But Steve, since the tower went down on top lane so quick, he's here soaking a farm. So this is a mistake from SK Gaming because they haven't shopped yet. They can't deny Steve that much. The wave bounce, eh, they'll push back eventually, but tricky. But Steve can just walk up right now.
And he's got back up too. Yeah. Svenskeren back, there was really no pressure against Steve, and he was able to, yeah, grab a little bit of that farm. Freddy, however, is getting free farm solo. So where does this leave our two top laners right now, Trepo?
Poor Steve walks all the way to the bottom lane, gets three CS, and then Rocket says, okay, you've done your job. Go back to the top lane. This is wrong with this farm. But yeah, he has to burn a teleport because that wave eventually pushed in the tower. I don't know really who pushed that out, but Steve's soaking up a lot of XP left and right. Same time, Rawless is getting easy farm too, so good start by Rocket. However, the gold advantage seems to still be in SK Gaming's favor, mostly, I guess it's on Svenskeren then. Or actually in the mid lane, we haven't been talking about too much. I was wondering where that 200 gold lead came from, because it should actually have been in Rocket's favor, but seems that Fox is pressuring NukeDuck in the mid lane.
Well, yeah, and you know, we mentioned before, it's oftentimes we see all of this action happening top and bottom and just a little bit of back and forth between the two teams. But now everyone's starting to focus their attention closer to the mid. Jankos is found by Svenskeren. Sven wants to take a fight here. Jankos is looking to jump away, but NukeDuck's there for the backup. Will he have enough damage? No, he's gonna force the flash. And now Steve has come to the rescue, clearing out some wards, throws the boomerang on to Sven. Will they continue to chase? It looks like no for the time being.
Good aggressive move from Svenskeren. He uses the fact that he was solo jungling, had the better positioning. Found Jankos first. In this matchup, it all matters who finds who. Who gets the first, well, who shoots first. Who is the Han Solo in this equation?
Well, looks like so far it's Ben Sven, but he is going to be taking a trip closer back to his own jungle and closer probably back to the base to shop for a little bit. Meanwhile, Rocket, they've kind of tried to even this one out. The tower, of course, fell on both sides, so now it's settled down a little bit. The gold lead is very slight here for SK Gaming. But Steve and Freddy, of course, were, you know, very typically set pretty far behind, but this is a big wave that Freddy's looking to take.
Yeah, Freddy definitely wants to soak tower up. There doesn't seem to be any pressure on Rocket's side to deny that. Let's see if they can use that wave pressure before Shen gets his ultimate down to get an objective somewhere, make a play, get a numbers advantage. Steve, he's afraid to farm this, so he might as well move to the mid lane, try and chunk somebody out, or, you know, do something, you know, put some pressure. If you're just loitering around in that lane, giving Freddy free farm, not really using your advantage right there.
Yeah, I can't help but feel like the more Rocket are kind of lollygagging around, the better this is for SK. They want the game to go even as long as possible. They have pretty heavy scaling on the side. Yes, there's a Victor on NukeDuck, and, you know, yes, they have this sort of pseudo-chase, pseudo-poke composition that they have, or that they're able to utilize. I still feel like the power of the picks on SK side is just going to overwhelm them eventually.
Lee Sin does fall off, so does Nidalee. I think both teams are okay with scaling, and again, it'll come down to play. It all comes down to how well Candy Panda can use, you know, his range in these fights. Vayne is a very short range AD carry. Requires a high level of micro play to really pull it off. Mm-hmm. So dance around a lot of threats, but there's limited targeted CC on the side of Rocket. only really the Pulverize that you can find with the Headbutt combo. And even then, you're looking for a Gnar ulti. That's pretty much it. And Vayne is pretty good at dealing with a Gnar, so... I didn't always like the Vayne pick from Candy Panda, but against a team like Rocket that's notorious for playing a very slow early to mid game, you can get away with the weaknesses of Vayne, especially picked into Sivir. Creates a very predictable early game. But again, we haven't seen any, you know, high-level strategy yet from either of these teams, so...
Yeah, it seems like they're just trying to feel each other out, really. Yeah. And as a result, we've only had the towers fall. We've had the gold dead even. We're not quite 10 minutes in, so it's still plenty of time. Nobody's really prioritized the dragon just yet either. Instead, they're kind of looking to just try to get a defensive angle here.
Yeah, and in these even games, what you have to do is just take an eye out vision, see how that eventually tries to snowball a lead. Vander, as we said before, 1.6 wards per minute, I believe it was. Compared to the 1.2 average of supports. So wards more than your average support. And SK, notorious for having relatively poor vision control. That might be the opening that Rocket eventually finds.
Yeah, they'll certainly be looking for one. This game continues
Janko
to be...
spots out Svenskeren.
I would say a little bit predictable in the opening, but SK are looking to try and grab themselves the vision control around the Dragon Pit. You have kind of a split up between N-Rated and Candy Panda here, but Vander's not keen on letting them get it for free.
Yeah, this is... A game in this state obviously devolves into what they call the Ward Wars. Mm-hmm. Two supports fighting over a pink ward.
Someone's gonna get that 30 gold. Oh!
But we're not cheering for that. No, we're not doing that. That's done. Disagree.
Oh, there we go. Okay, so... it's still kind of settled with Steve and Freddy up top. They're really struggling to try and get themselves back into this game. So, who has the edge here when you're lacking the farm?
I mean, in that matchup, eventually... Didn't hear that. Gnar gets ahead of the Shen with the poke if he gets that cleaver, but as it... We missed that actually on your screen right there. We saw that both teams have an incredibly late early first dragon on average. SK and Rocket were hovering around a 15-minute mark, and it shows that they have these very slow early games. Either they're losing them and they don't get the early dragons themselves, or they're just not, you know, setting anything in motion. The way you usually get your dragon is you push your side lanes, you free up that resource on the bot lane, you know, you move that to the mid lane, pressure that in, then get some deep vision, and then force your opponent to be so afraid that they can't face check that you can secure that objective. Very few objectives taken, traded at all, just very slow and early start.
Yeah, I mean, this worked well for SK last split when they had Forgiven and they were just the masters of the 1-3-1, but they can't really rely on that anymore, and it's you can tell that they've been trying a lot of different things, and one of them is not trying to secure all those early objectives. They pretty much just match the pace of Rocket. Rocket, as you said, are known for this very slow start to a game, very defensive opening to the game. So it's really no surprise that neither team has attempted this dragon. They've really only been throwing some wards down in the general area.
Now we do see that after the lane swap, Gnar doesn't really have that defensive potential to chunk out the Chen just yet. And then the bot lane, see the Vayne and Lulu kind of like threatening the CS of Sivir and Alistar there. So they're slightly getting a bit of a lead. And SK is fine with that. Because bot lane will never be able to fight. SK will always be able to start a fight because Freddy always has the opportunity to just ultimate in and get a taunt off Nuke Duck. Q, but...
Backstop for now.
No fancy insects. Fox wasn't around, so...
Nope. And actually, as far as the farm goes, this is actually evened out quite a bit as Sven does take another stop to this. A lot of people on Rocket's side heading up top. Still a few more in the middle just trying to keep it defended. But this opens up an opportunity for SK to go ahead and start off this dragon. Nobody's at home. They're not going to be able to get here in time. So SK, recognizing the opening that they have, take it without a moment's hesitation.
And Rated won the ward war against his foe and adversary, Vander. And SK finally secure a dragon. 12 minutes in the game.
That's worth cheering. Absolutely.
Second, I guess, objective for them. Third in the game so far. No kills. A lot of anticipation.
Yeah, both the teams, they're really playing to just not lose that first blood up. It's really just been some solo plays around. Nobody's really gathered up. And you can tell how risk-averse these two teams are. And it's a wonder, as Steve jumps onto Freddy and that Meganar farm, he's still very
tanky. Here's Jankos.
Jankos is here. There's no tower to fall back to. Freddy's got a dash. He's got a flash. He might have to use them both. Steve's gone back to Mininar, though.
Yeah, and they
now
saw Svenskeren.
Svenskeren's here.
Well, they were afraid of Svenskeren, so... Nothing really happened. We had some
almost
action,
happened.
At least. Almost happened.
Yeah, it just speaks to how defensive these two
Fox
teams
is going here, getting to the poison.
As I say it, Nuke Duck's in some trouble. Fox is on him, and he poisons down. 13 minutes in. Well earned.
Yeah, eventually, once you hit that level 9, and you have those Twin Fangs maxed out, all you need to do is connect one poison. Because Victor is immobile. He's running the cleanse, but he flashes, you flash after him, as long as you dodge that gravity field. And this is big. A lot of tower damage on the mid lane, and this is...
Oh! Yeah, Svenktaren, he's going to be in some trouble. He's battered and bruised around, but they can't quite pick him up as Freddy comes in with the stand united. Steve Yankos Vander leading the charge on Fox to push the wave back, but they don't get a kill.
Svenktaren calling for some help there. Got cut out by the Q flash from Vander. As I was saying, it's big that they got the damage on the middle tower because that's the most wave clear on Rocket's side, that Victor E. It's really hard to push and siege into a Victor. And if any tier 1 tower goes down, you want it to be the mid lane tower because it opens up the map so much more. So not only was that a crucial pick off, you know, to tilt that matchup in favor for Fox, he also got the first blood bonus. And in addition to that, a whole lot of damage on the middle tower. So this is good. We might see the game hopefully accelerate if SK can push up their side lanes, free up their resources, pressure the mid lane, get the Victor off the wave, get that first tower down. I mean, then we can see those ward wars no longer go on in the river, but move towards the wolves, the wraiths, and so on.
So little advantages here for SK. They've managed to get a pick here. They've gotten the first dragon. They're not really ceding any ground to Rocket, who again are playing this out very defensively. And if SK can continue to take advantage of that, they can turn those small edges into a big lead.
Yeah, definitely so, but very tempered early game. Gold bang on even, even though the first blood happened. See, but we understand why these teams are playing the way they are right now. They're just so afraid of losing that they might not want to snowball the game as hard as they can because they really need that victory right now.
Exactly. When you're combined 3 wins between these two teams, you know, it's very easy to let that get into your head and think,
hey,
okay, well,
I've been in these situations.
Yeah, well, what do you do? What do you do in this situation then, Kreppel?
I mean, become a caster.
All right. One possible option. For these guys, though, in the more immediate future, see what they continue to do to try and keep this game back in control.
You find a systematic opening. That's what you do. You try and make a plan with 2 steps ahead. And Fox,
I'll talk about a systematic opening. Vander gets the combo on him, and Yankos will take him down. Steve was turned to stone for a second, but he's right back to it. Here's the Chaos Storm coming out. Yankos is pushed away. Freddy trying to tank the line. He's very tanky with the Wild Growth, but still going extremely low as Svenktaren drops low as well.
Yeah, and SK Gaming can never win a fight if one of their 2 threats goes down immediately. Fox gets popped. No return damage, then the fight is almost unwinnable because Vayne, she hasn't ramped up to the hyper carry that she will become in the late game, not quite yet. And good pickoff on Rocket, good opening, and that's what you need.
Yeah, to grab that back in control, they get themselves a gold lead, they knock down the mid tower.
That's the most important part, get that objective. Always tie your kills with an objective.
And that's something Rocket does well. When they do manage to get those kills, they know what to do with them. The problem is, you have to wait for opponents to make mistakes. That time, worked out.
Yeah, they did catch Fox with his pants down. He got that first spot, but he got his he used his flash to get it, and good punish by Rocket.
They're going to lose a tower here, though, even though there's no minions away. They're able to tank the line, and Svenktaren!
Beautiful.
Mid insect, and down went Nuke Duck.
Yeah, lack of respect on SK's side. They're not thinking ahead. If you make that play, if you get that tower, you will have to base. Rocket's members will be coming back from the base, so if you don't base immediately and you lose the tempo and you're not back in time to defend that tower, you might as well drop it entirely because they'll have a HP item advantage, and then, yeah, once the Q connects. Mm-hmm.
It seems like both these teams are just sort of trading little bits here. Small mistakes, but they are being punished. So clearly, both SK and Rocket are learning from the mistakes of their previous games. It's good. Good to see that evolution.
Well, they're still making, every team is still
That's
making mistakes.
That's just true. It's the flip side of the coin.
They're learning how to capitalize on the enemy's mistakes while still making their own.
So they got one half of the equation right now, Kreppo.
Yeah.
It makes for an exciting game, though, now that it's kicked up a notch in pace. So Freddy trying to push the tide of Rocket's minion wave back. He knows Yankos is around the side, still safely farming away. That is a very tanky Shen, even on one item.
Yeah, and because the lane swap kind of slowed down, Steve wasn't able to get too many offensive items early to start bullying out, you know, Freddy and penetrate that armor. So he stayed tanky enough to deal with Steve for the majority of the match. I kept SK somewhat in the game, bought them some time. Yeah, we have kind of forgotten about Candy Panda. Blade of the Rune King finished right now, going for his second item. Wants those Silver Bolt procs to deal a lot of damage in fights.
Yeah, and if Rocket are the ones that end up forgetting about Candy Panda, this could be really rough for them. 30 seconds on the next dragon, you can be certain this one will not be free for SK. Rocket already pushing forward, throwing down the wards, clearing the crabs away, making sure that SK cannot get in there undetected.
Yeah, and it's very hard to regain vision into one of these like high mobility poke compositions because you have to constantly walk into the dark, and in the dark could be an Italy Spear, could be a Victor E right here. Need some laser beams, could be an Angry Cow.
Both these top laners too can get into the fight. Yes, there's a teleport down on Freddy, but of course he's got another one in his back pocket.
Thing is, Freddy can cancel Steve's, and if Steve is not in Mega Gnar, he can't cancel Freddy, so that's a big disparity right there.
And you don't want to be in Meganar when you're teleporting in anyways, then your fight's not as effective.
You want to be on the edge of that rage bar, 80 or 90 rage. So where you want to be, roughly. Side lane's pretty neutral right now. There's slow pushing on the bot lane, so this frees up Candy Panda as a resource. So you see him pull off, rather. Join his team. SK wants control over the dragon area right now.
This is smart, too. They know that Steve is in Meganar trying to push in, and that Rocket have thus backed off. So even though the crab control is in their favor, that's not really going to matter much. It's going to be, at best, a 4v5. Jankos is actually going to move in onto Freddy, so they're going to try to trade here.
Yeah, this is a good reaction by Rocket. They know they lose that dragon, but they have to hurry up if they want to rotate to the top tower, because SK have that slow pushing wave on the bottom lane. The Candy Panda set in motion. They can group on that wave. They don't have much wave clear. Victor is completely out of position, so we need to see if they can clear this wave with the Sivir.
Well, Freddy is still kind of fast.
We'll be rough.
Meganar's going close. There's the tower down. Steve goes Meganar, but now, once again, SK, they're setting their sights on trading. They'll easily be able to secure this one up.
I don't like the fact that Rawls and Vander went to the bottom lane, because they're not going to be able to hold that. They may as well be in mid and went for maybe a base race scenario where they have two lanes pushing in on Rocket side, only one on SK. Yeah. They stopped the bleeding.
Well, let's slow down a minute, because there's a lot of stuff that's happened, a lot of objectives that have been traded in the last few minutes. The dragon goes over to SK, Rocket are able to trade a tower, but then they lose one of their own in the bottom side. As it stands, Rocket holds a slim gold lead, despite the two dragons over to SK. And that's really just going to be on the back of slightly better farming, but SK definitely, they seem like they're the ones controlling the pace of this game, Crepo.
Yeah, I definitely think this game is slowly going towards SK Gaming right here, because we saw Rocket, they had the vision control on the dragon, and chose to do nothing with it. They didn't force a bait, they didn't force any poke, they're not grouping up with Victor and Nidalee at all to poke somebody out and get the tower. They're only getting towers when SK gives them the opportunity to trade. But in the midst of every trade, SK gets an additional dragon, and that's a big thing. If we move towards three dragons, 5% movement speed will come in big. Somewhat nullified on the hunt.
Mm-hmm. Well, when you've got a Vayne on your team, when you've got a Cassiopeia on your team, a little extra movement speed is going to go a long way. And yes, it's offset by Rala's ultimate, but then that basically means that part of what Rocket's trying to do isn't going to work out too well, is it?
Yeah, it won't. No, we're just waiting for Steve to get tanky enough to become a split push threat on that Black Cleaver Gnar. However, SK has an answer today, though. Yesterday, when we saw the Gnar-Shen matchup, he was the only one could deal with the Gnar, potentially. But Vayne will later on be able to, I think, deal with Steve a little better.
Yeah. Let's see if Steve's able to handle it for the time being. Rall is there for the defense as Candy Panda goes to push up the wave. They're bringing in Svenskeren as well. Another wave at their backs. Fox is making the slow trek up, slithering through the river. And SK might look to throw their weight around here. 21 minutes on the clock, looking to start pressuring Rocket, who are just going to fall back from this tower. SK Gaming will grab that one for free. And the gold lead, back in their favor.
Yeah, it's very hard to defend these tier 1 towers at this point in the game, because it's too hard to trade a tier 1 for a tier 2, because the distance is too big on the map. You know, Rocket couldn't really go for a tier 2 in mid, because otherwise they would end up trading two towers anyway, so might as well give up that free tier 1 turret. Luckily for them, or unluckily for them, they still have that one tier 1 up on the bottom lane, SK Gaming. That's kind of the only thing keeping this game from being a little more even. But that one will eventually fall.
Well, SK are really doing a good job here of grouping up and forcing Rocket to dance to their tune. It's really kind of been the story of the game, not the grouping up, but the fact that they have controlled the tempo. And this is, I feel like this is just Rocket's inability to do exactly that. As Svenskeren goes in, he's going to be slowed up for just a second, but he's got the Wild Growth on, and in goes Freddy after the stand united. They're just looking to find anyone they can, as Candy Panda comes around the side in the final hour, decides to chase onto the Sivir. Rawls under tower. Candy doesn't care, and he picks him up, but he might fall. No, the heal will keep him alive. Freddy just knocked out of tower range, and he's safe.
Candy Panda managed to do what he couldn't do last week, the 1v1, Vayne into Sivir. We saw Hjarnen take the better of him last week, but finally he gets that retribution, gets that kill. But still, sloppy fight. I mean, the way that all started, you know, Svenskeren goes in, gets pulverized immediately, Shen lands, Shen goes in, eventually Candy Panda goes into the left. Let's watch that again. So, yeah, brush check, you connect. Svenskeren gets peeled off, and I feel like Rocket can disengage here perfectly fine. Rawls steps in and he doesn't really have eyes on Candy Panda. Tries to peel for Jankos, who's fine. He flashes out, but Rawls oversteps and he gets baited. Yeah, good tumble by Candy Panda. Acted as if he was going down in the fight, but then used the invisibility of his tumble to go upwards. And caught, you know, Mr. Rawls with his pants down.
Yeah, and as you said, it was really sloppy. I feel, though, that Svenskeren in particular and all of SK, they're a little confident in the fact that they've got so many shields if someone who does decide to dive in. They didn't actually even break through much of them with all the combos. Yes, he was CC'd for days, but it's going to be hard for Rocket to pick off a single target, and I feel like SK, very well aware of this, are playing a little reckless on purpose.
Yeah, SK is at least trying to go offensive. Having a hard time to make an opening with their composition. I mean, the only hard engage they have is Taunt Flash. And yeah. Then, yeah, Svenskeren going in and getting a kick flash out, perhaps. So I like that he's going in, even if it looks like it's a sloppy engage. It's starting fights, at least.
And they got one.
SK is confident with starting the fight, you know, being five men together and just having the engage window. If they can use their vision, that's enough. But if Rocket actually wards properly and can see SK coming, then it's going to be almost impossible to start a good fight.
Mm-hmm. Well, here's a question for Rocket, though. Right now, they're not giving up too much to SK, a little bit here, a little bit there. That could turn into something big. But for the time being, what did they need to do to keep SK from getting to this late game point where they're happy with, and also to keep them from continuing to pick these little advantages up?
Yeah, they need to use a good on the hunt, you know, manipulate the side waves so SK has to spread their resources, then get that movement speed steroid, catch somebody off guard. But even on their side, they're running double poke with a Gnar and then an Alistar. That's their only engage, so Rocket is doing what Rocket always does. Lay back, you know, wait for a mistake, and if the enemy makes it, sure, we can win the game. If they don't, so we lose. Not too big of a fan of that line of play, because I feel you'll always get exploited by better teams. We haven't seen Rocket use their double poke to their advantage once.
Well, at least as far as builds go, they're planning for a little bit of a later game, which is, you know, the Rocket calling card Jankos with the Rod of Ages. He's had that for a little while now. You know, the diamond build, as a lot of people have called it. But they're not really making use of it, as you mentioned. Not use of the poke at all. They're giving up Dragon Control again to SK Gaming. Yes, they're all in the area, but it's way too little, way too late. They barely check into it. They throw a boomerang. It's a token gesture, and they get absolutely nothing for this. Third Dragon goes over to SK Gaming. It's 25 minutes in. That's going to start to get scary.
Yeah, initially they could trade a Dragon for a Tier 1 tower, but they ran out of towers to trade for, and they could have foreseen this. If you know you're not going to contest that, why hang around in the mid lane and watch SK Gaming finish the Dragon? This is poor pre-planning from Rocket. They're not thinking two steps ahead, they're thinking one step ahead. In their minds, they're going, okay guys, Dragon's gonna spawn in a minute from now, let's ward a bit. All right, we warded. Okay guys, Dragon's coming up, what can we do? And then they realized there's almost nothing they can do. But if they were thinking two steps ahead and they were like, okay, how is this fight gonna play out? All right, we're gonna lose. How do we solve that? Okay, let's migrate to the left side of the map. Deny them some vision, you know, make the left side dark. Perhaps even season that tier 2 tower or inhibitor turret. Something, you know, set up a bait.
Two steps forward, or maybe one step forward and then two back. Steve is the one who shoved back. He's forced to use his Gnar ulti and a flash to avoid Freddy and Candy Panda. Gravity Field is thrown down. In comes Vander. Rocket looking to collapse back, but Candy and Freddy are already on the retreat path. Fox coming around the side. This could be a bloody fight.
Oh, Steve connects.
Oh, goodbye, Steve.
Oh, fantastic kick.
Kick back in by Sven, but it doesn't matter. He's taken down by Rales. Jankos now moving forward, stunned up by Freddy.
Fox is
He's
going to
get evaporated. It's a 2-for-1 so far. Fox just can't make it over as the Gromp aggroes him. And all said and done, SK get the better of that trade.
Again, Svenskeren going in and securing one or two kills for his team here. Always being the aggressor. It somehow works out for SK Gaming. But even if it didn't get the kill on Steve, what they got is his flash, and that's vital, because that's Rocket's only, you know, comeback potential in these fights. Having Gnar flash in and use the ulti, we saw how well it can work on a Gnar for SK Gaming yesterday. So getting that flash down is big. Panda's flash is down as well. Rocket, for the next 4 minutes, have no engage tools.
But for SK Gaming, you know, this just kind of proves the confidence that they had in making this pick. Candy Panda on this Vayne, you said it in Champ Select, he's not going to have a hard time dealing with this Gnar at all. Well, that was definitely true.
Especially if you have a Stand Unite on your back, you know.
Yeah, no fear at all. Uh-oh, Vander! Let's see if he can get away at the cost of an Unbreakable Will.
Man, this is where the vision control starts faltering for Rocket. They don't have enough offensive zoning control to get those wards in. So eventually, SK Gaming will be able to choke them out of vision. They might wait for fourth Dragon, get some Baron control. Because they're moving around Rocket around the map. Every time SK walks forward, Rocket walks backwards. They need to keep doing that. Eventually, push Rocket into their base. Night of Vision, set up a potential bait, or simply that rush down the Baron. You know, later in the game with Vayne and Cassiopeia,
it's not hard to do.
You can take down a Baron quick. And here's Steve.
We've seen this before. Candy Panda this time is knocked into the wall. Let's see, with the help of Freddy, what he can do. Steve realizes he's got nothing left, and Candy Panda, true silver bolts, true damage.
And look at the other side of the map. Nothing is happening on Rocket's side because they're so far back. SK can comfortably put two people, three people in that bot lane because Rocket has no idea where they are. And once they show up, it's too late to react. They're too far away from any objective, from any tower to trade, so Steve was essentially overextended.
It's just Rocket are not doing enough realizing when they have a slight opening. It's, yeah, they're going to lose somebody. Okay, cool. Steve is going to get caught. Whatever. You have a number advantage, and then they don't do anything with it. They're no longer really seeing these slight openings and taking them. They're relying on mistakes, big mistakes, but that isn't happening from SK anymore. SK are controlling this game.
And we're seeing some pretty big item spikes here. Triple items on Candy Panda, including the Last Whisper. That's huge. And then Fox is racking up the AP as well. Deathcap finished.
So much
this double threat composition. In addition to that, so much shields. Shen is getting incredibly tanky. Rocket does not have time to get through the Shen and the Lee Sin, because by that time, SK's double threat composition will have taken them down in this fight. But they're having a hard time getting to Vayne, getting to Cassiopeia with all that peel from SK, so... Big task ahead, and their poke is just not enough, you know. If Enraider can comfortably walk up to Jankos, eat the spear on that distance, and lose maybe 15% of his health, then Jankos is, you know, out of the fight almost. If your poke is not threatening anymore, then you lose so much ground.
And that's exactly what's happening this game. Svenskeren, he's able to just sidestep the spear, go right back to clearing the vision. SK Gaming are continuing to press their edge into the Rocket jungle, keeping their sights set on the Baron. There's a dragon available in another minute or two. That would be number four for them. And Rocket have no answer for this.
And this goes back to champions like where we said the first pick, Lee Sin. Honestly, I question it a little bit, but it seems to work out because Jankos was first on the Nidalee. Hasn't had a poor showing so far, not much impact. And Svenskeren, he's been starting all these fights.
Yeah.
It was a smart takeaway.
Did you see why they decided to take that away as quickly as they did? It didn't allow Jankos to get on something comfortable. He's clearly not been able to play well on it.
And then the Gnar into Shen doesn't have enough pressure. Compare that to what Freddy was doing yesterday on his Gnar. He was beating his opposing Shen pretty single-handedly, but right now Steve is...
Oh, he's teleporting in. Steve!
All right.
Bye.
So that's teleport down. Tier 1 tower still up in the bot lane, so no split push advantage for Rocket. So they're playing a 4-1 with double poke. Their poke's not doing much damage. Split push just teleported out of a single fight with a Shen.
And now the Shen's got two teleports.
And Dragon's coming up in 15 seconds.
This could look to be another SK Dragon, Krepo. Rocket really are not in a good position to even try and contest this. They've sent Jankos up to the top side. Yep. After Dragon, then Baron starts to become a real possibility. Rocket are actually clustering around that. We might actually see them attempt to trade.
They won't panic Baron right here.
There we go. They're going to just set up some
or bait it at least. But SK is ready to move, right? They don't have to take this Dragon yet. They can take this Dragon now, a minute from now, 2 minutes from now. All they have to do is prevent this Baron.
Sven's trying to solo this one. He might be able to get it. There's no chance that Rocket...
They have
really
the vision. See,
this.
They see Rallus and they saw Jankos, and that's enough. Now they know there's nobody on the Baron anymore. Comfortably let their jungle finish it. Rocket does the same thing, moving again.
But this dragon's definitely going down.
Blue Orb's coming up in Candy Panda.
They can check this.
Bit of a face check. Be careful.
Four dragons to none right now.
Blue Orb.
They know it's not happening because of that. Perfectly timed after it comes right back up. So Rocket aren't going to be able to get...
And now their mid lane is exposed. This is big.
Oh, boy.
Rotational play from SK Gaming here.
And they've got a wave pushing on the bottom side. Now they all they have to do is stop everyone backing away. Rallus is kicked in the wrong direction, but it doesn't really matter as they're just all stalled out. Fox will throw down the Petrifying Gaze. Nuke Duck blows away by Fox. Candy Panda on the Rampage kill. Steve has even found a kill, but it's slight revenge as they've lost three already, and it's gonna be a fourth. That's a double kill over to the Vayne, and Jankos is left to defend the base solo as the remaining SK Gaming members are gonna grab themselves a Baron.
Four dragons for SK Gaming, four kills for them in this fight. Looking to take down there. First Baron of the game right now. And there was not much Rocket could do at this point. Mistakes were made ages ago.
Oh yeah.
10 minutes ago,
but
15
now
minutes
now
ago.
But now they're cashed in by SK.
Yeah, they're finally getting manifested. Jankos, he wants to steal here, but SK can take this slow. They have all the time in the world to try and fight Jankos.
Is he the hero that Rocket deserves right now? Freddy's gonna make sure that is not the case.
Candy Panda with the
jumps out of the pit, no! Can't get the steal off. It's taken secured by Candy Panda, and they will grab Jankos as well.
All right.
6-0-1-3 on the Vayne. He's gotten tumbling.
Steve's teleport was on. I feel SK Gaming could have done that slower. risk the potential steal here. Let's watch that again. Yeah, because Rocket is trying to rotate down to the mid lane in a quick, efficient path, they get caught out in the jungle. Watch Fox right now. R flash, and then immediately unleashes on Nuketuk. Two or three Twin Fangs is all we needed. And then Steve doesn't have enough tankiness. Yeah, he takes down Fox, but
that Candy Panda is untouched.
I really do want to highlight how well they're using the shielding, though, because that was one of the things that allowed him to stay alive long enough to take down Nuketuk. Yes, he went down eventually to Steve, but still, 4-for-1, not a big deal. They were able to secure the Baron nice and easy. So SK, once again, big lead for them here. 5,000 gold ahead, 4 dragons to none. Now they've got a Baron. They've even got a tower lead, as slight as it is. They can push anywhere they want on this map. They own Summoner's Rift right now, Grepo.
Yeah, this is the direction this game has been going in for a while. It was slow and steady, but that's only because of the dragons. You know, in a game where you have such a distinctive lead in pressure and zone control, all you have to do, if you're a little hesitant, is just wait for dragons, take 5 of them, and then eventually you're dealing poke through damage, and yeah, then there's not much the opposing team can do.
Mm-hmm. With that, they can keep pressuring in with the Baron buff on, continue to try and shove the waves with not really needing to respect the poke, because Rocket just hasn't been able to use it very well. And when that fifth dragon does come up, they can just try to end the game off the back of it.
And this is why I like the new Baron creep so much that got changed at the start of this season, or last season rather, is just that the fact that these AoE mages have a hard time clearing these minions, so you can actually snowball the game. Svenskeren going in.
Oh, he's gonna kick Nuketuk out, and he's just so tanky, he's able to stay alive through all this. Candy going a little bit low as well. He gets the wild growth on Svenskeren, burning away right now, but Rocket just don't have any extra damage to Chaos Storm. They're sitting in it, and they don't care. Freddy going low, forced to flash. Yankos should be able to finish him off. The spear doesn't go where he needs. And Rala is down, but amazingly, every member of SK Gaming lived through that onslaught.
Poor Yankos. They're still pushing. SK members are zigzagging left and right, dodging spears constantly. Next one on Candy Panda, though.
Oh, there's the shutdown they were looking for. Yankos will grab some revenge, but Freddy's already teleporting in. He's going to be on a gravity field, but he dashes in on Steve anyways. Gets the taunt off for just a second as he is going to get lasered down away from the turret. Fox and Enraged are still here to try and force the advantage. They can't quite get it done, though. Rocket will defend the turret, but it's looking dire for them.
What a messy fight. Props to Rocket, though, they held on. Didn't lose an inhibitor tower or inhib against the Baron up team. Yankos eventually landing that one spear they needed. Straight onto Candy Panda, follows up. Use this flash, though. There's some good jukes in that fight from SK Gaming, too. We saw Svenskeren go up and down. Somehow managed to survive that. Freddy dodges it with the flash, and then eventually dodges the spear in turn from Yankos, too.
Oop.
And that's big. If you're trying to crawl back into this game, you're trying to land these crucial spears and people keep juking you, it almost feels insulting. It feels like, hey, I'm a better player than you. I predicted where your skill set was going. Here we go for round 3.
Yeah, Nuketuk's the one that's targeted. He's kicked right into and raided, and Fox blown up. That's a big snake. As Svenskeren will take down Vander in all of the chaos as well. Two members down. Rocket looking to try and miracle defend, but Sven doesn't look to give them the chance. He goes a little far forward, though. Ral is around the side on the hunt pot, but Freddy is going to instantly taunt him, and now he's forced to run backwards right into the waiting arms of Candy Panda. And now Steven Yankos are the only ones left standing to keep this game alive. SK Gaming, with a pack of minions at their back, are looking to shove in to end the game.
Yeah, and SK is going to finally break open this base from Rocket. Took them a while. 4 dragons right now. You got a Baron. Gonna take this inhib. Will they go for the straight finish? Space just one more time.
But they don't even have to at this point. Now they're able to back away. There we go. Go ahead and pop the coin. And now it's less than a minute before drag. They can back away. They can shop. You can see Svenskeren already doing that. Clear the wave up top. They've got all the time in the world because Rocket has just consistently failed to pressure them this entire game.
Yeah, SK looking a lot more relaxed in their player cams as well compared to Rocket. They're under pressure. And with this composition, it's so hard to find an opening because everything is so conditional. So many things need to go right. Let's watch that fight one more time. If Svenskeren connects, he has no hesitation to go in. Ward dashes, and I can flash. Nuketuk's guns is already down, but even if he has 3 cleanses, he will never get out of that.
Yeah, it doesn't matter how many you've got. The damage is just way too real at the end of the day. So, it's still going to keep on going for a minute as Sven just jumps in on that one. Rollis, he kind of gets baited. Oh, I can go ahead and take him out. Wait, there's a Freddy.
No, he has to commit to that fight while SK is seemingly doing 2 things at once. SK was pushing right there, and then they went for the fight. Rocket tried to see that as an opening, but eventually SK collapsed. They had enough shields to stay alive long enough.
But now Dragon's back up. This is going to be number 5 if SK are able to secure it. Yeah,
this is the panic play. Rocket will definitely engage here and try and stop that dragon somehow, but they're stuck in a choke point.
Teleport in the back. They didn't have any wards. They weren't able to get into SK's jungle and place them.
Look at that zone control from the Cassiopeia Poison. Both their carries are on the wrong side. They don't have the backup.
Yeah, Freddy is able to come in if he needs to, and he looks like he's going to be doing just that as Fenskaren is going to jump forward. There is the Petrifying Gaze from Fox to push them all back as Steve, Vander, and Rollins look to gang up on Candy Panda. The Rock will take him down, but a double kill goes over to Fox. Is it going to be enough for him to end this fight and end this game? Triple kill. Freddy and N-Rated are able to pick up the Sivir on the back, and Vander's going down. The quadra kill, and Fox and the rest of SK are gonna look dead.
Yeah, SK split up a little bit, but luckily for them, Rocket decided to use On the Hunt to go to the side where the tanks were and not the carries. Eventually the carries showed up to the fight, and boy did they carry. Triple quarter kill for Fox, and SK taking their second victory.
Rocket should have checked for snakes in their booth, that is for sure. As it stands, they're going down 39 minutes into the game. SK Gaming are the winners. That's two in a row.
That is two in a row.
Smiles on the faces, well-earned victory, methodical over Rocket.
I wouldn't call it methodical just yet. I'd call it slow, and I feel they
deliberate, maybe.
Donated the victory a little bit by Rocket the same way Elements was.
All right.
It spells out some good things for SK Gaming. I don't want to be overly harsh here. Some progression. Svenskeren and Freddy yet again showed up big. They were the question marks. Coming in, you know, we need them to carry in addition to the other members of SK Gaming. But where SK makes statements, Rocket leave a lot of questions. Another game, passive, slow, lack of engage, no foresight, one step ahead.
And they continue the trend of just kind of letting it go a while. And, you know, against Elements, it was, they had a good early game, and then they just eased up on the pedal. Couldn't get anything done. You can see that expression. It says it all.
Yeah, this man right there, Yamato Cannon.
Same problems.
They'll have to go back to the drawing board. And we're getting closer to the halfway point in the split right now. Now 8 games been played, right?
About there, yeah. So it does leave a lot of questions for Rocket. But on the SK side, any news, any good news at all, is something that's going to be very relieving to them. They find themselves after 6-game drought. 2-0.
H2K, they are getting ready to take the Rift, so let's take a look at those lineups. Starting with H2K on the blue side in second place with Otawamne, Lulex, Ryu, Yarnen, Kasing, and their coach Prali. H2K, more of the same, methodical in the early game, excellent macro game strategy. What a fantastic team to look at.
Yeah, and we just saw how Kasing here managed to hook freeze. We highlighted it before, we highlight Kasing almost every single time. This is the thing about H2K, they have great macro play, good shot calling, and then they have fantastic individual players. And I mean, that's why they are so good. Odomne can carry games, Kasing as a support, Yarnen is stepping up big time as an AD carry. Forgiven rated him as number one in Europe. So this teammate just has so many good individual players. We're again looking at Kasing, 93% kill participation. He was just everywhere.
Yeah, and it makes you wonder where the ceiling is for H2K. They're up against the Giants in this one, so let's take a look at their opponents. Wurlib, Frederick, Pepinero, Audrey, Godfred, and Lothar, who we heard from, saying, well, we used to make so many absurd mistakes, but honestly, yesterday in their game, their early game versus Gambit, it was kind of more of that, in my opinion.
I completely agree. I think yesterday they really struggled. Gambit looked great. And like we said, for Giants, there's more questions being asked now. The first couple of weeks, it kind of felt like, no, actually it was like everybody had written them off. We expected the team that just requalified to not really perform. They performed at a higher level, and then once people set their sights on them, now Giants are unable to elevate themselves once more.
And Wurlib normally used to be this like split pusher, really strong top laner, and yesterday he just performed like terrible. So they just need to pick up, he needs to pick up his game again and do his usual quite impressive performances, and maybe they can grab this game somehow.
We'll see. He was pushed onto Rumble yesterday, couldn't quite keep going. We'll see what he gets his hands on today. It's time to get into the draft, so we're going to shoot it over to the caster desk.
Thank you very much, Shox. We are indeed getting ready for H2K and Giants, who definitely do need to, I feel, step things up, because they had a very happy point where they started out the split, and everyone was very in unexpected surprise about how they were doing. But the H2K, they've been the ones who've been on the smooth sailing boat, and they've cruised it all the way to second place so far, Krepo.
Yeah, that's the difference between both these teams. H2K have this steady progression, both in terms of gameplay and just like champion pools, and everything goes right for them, and they have a distinct clear goal in mind. Whereas Giants, they had some things that worked for them, but they're still you know, newly adapting to becoming a bit of a middle-of-the-pack team. And once that Morgana gets banned out, once that Jax is taken off the table, and yeah, Giant seems to be struggling. And
they
yeah.
seem a little bit lost, and that's exactly, it's a formulaic thing, and this is no strange thing for H2K. They're a team that plays it by the numbers. So far, numbers do not lie.
Now, it does look like, unless H2K ban Ryze or Echo themselves, one of them will be open. Pretty contested pick so far. I got our stats guy whispering into my ear that Ryze was, for the first time, I think, last game not picked or banned. So he's now at 25 picked or banned out of 26 games that he's been available since his buff, which is insane. And Echo has been in 14 out of 16 games. And it's Xerath banned, so they want to deny the comeback potential from Pepinero, deny him the poke. And yeah, H2K doesn't like dealing with these type of champions that can stall out the game easily. You know, poke from far, wave cleave from far. They want to bring it to you, out-rotate you, outsmart you, and then just tear you down on the strategic level.
But one thing that's worth noting here is that for, I think, the first time this split, Oduwamne's Rumble has been banned away. No team has been doing this. He's been tearing it up, and he won't have that option.
Yeah, but does have the option of Ryze right here. Kalista banned out by Giants Gaming. Echo is up too. Sivir is open too, a staple champion for H2K. They might say, like, we have an answer to everything, so give us the utility on AD carry. We'll outrotate you with great speed. A lot of options here.
Yeah, and you know, in H2K's hands, in Yharnam's hands especially, Sivir's almost becomes a hard carry. He went 12-0-13 in that game. Absolutely insane. I do not blame them in the slightest for locking this in first and saying, go ahead and take the Ryze. We can handle it.
Yeah, I think you can drop the almost and just becomes a hard carry. He does everything right with Sivir, and his team rather plays around it perfectly too. So not afraid to play that early. And with a spell shield and with good positioning and with good peel from Kasing, it's incredibly hard to take down a Sivir. Whereas she has a relatively weak laning phase, H2K usually swaps out of that or just manages to stay even. They have died a couple of times in that 2v2 lane at the start of the split, I feel, but they've, you know, tightened up their play. A lot more secure, a lot more calculated. And now Giants, they're like, okay, we just got donated Ryze and Echo. Do we actually want those picks? Did H2K leave them open with a reason? Are we gonna get countered here? Almost seems too easy.
Yeah, questions going through their head right now. Well, clearly the Echo is valued enough. They also decide to take the Thresh. This is a pick away from Kasing. And of course, we'll see what Godfrey can make of it.
But yeah, you steal the Thresh away from Kasing, but then you play it into a Sivir, you know, who has spell shield for the hook at least. So you'll have to try and get the spell shield down with Flay. Or, you know, kill the spell shield with hook and then Flay immediately if you want to threaten her at all. And it's hard to hit targets in fights with On the Hunt because you're used to people dodging in certain direction at a certain move speed, but with On the Hunt, that gets very complex in these fights. However, talking about complex, Echo picked up. Where's it gonna go?
We don't know.
Like a Pepinero champion to me. It feels like Pepinero could excel at Echo in the mid lane.
I think that's definitely true. We're gonna have to wait until the next rotation to see if Giants opt for that strategy or if they decide to go for something a little bit different. We've seen it play top, we've seen it play jungle, but I agree, Pepinero most likely champ, or most likely guy to go to.
Yeah, we actually probably have to wait two more rotations, I feel.
Wondering when the Scragas would go over.
This is actually interesting. I think I missed this, and I should have actually pointed out on the first rotation. There were so many picks that Giant wanted. They wanted to steal the Thresh, they wanted to secure the Echo, but they left open a tier 1 jungler for H2K on their second rotation on blue side. That is quite unheard of. Getting Gragas for free, pretty much.
Third rotation, yeah.
Yeah, or in respectively on their second rotation. Call it what you want. Rek'Sai was banned out by Giants Gaming and did not pick up the Gragas on their first rotation. So that's peculiar, and I would even call it a mistake.
I'll have to see if it does end up costing Giants in the long run. The Gnar is also locked in for Oduwamne, and let's see what Giants do decide to go for.
That means the Echo is likely going jungle, because he's probably the third best pick in the jungle right now. Mm-hmm. If both Rek'Sai and
could always flex it though.
Yeah.
Well,
I don't like the Evelynn pick. I really would have gone Echo jungler here, but who am I to disagree?
I mean, Ezreal have three wins on it at least. It's a number.
It's a number, indeed. Okay.
We're able to flank with it effectively in the past, but I feel like against a team like H2K, yeah, I can see your look of apprehension. It's not going to be as easy.
But the start of the draft for H2K is yet again so solid. Sivir, Gragas, Gnar, you can build anything with that. You can go every direction that you want. So much versatility and so little counter potential.
Yeah, H2K can fill this out with pretty much whatever they want. We still need that support choice for Kasing. We still need Ryu's champion, but we've shown that both those have been very versatile, especially Ryu. This is a guy that he can do utility, he can carry, he can do whatever H2K needs him to do. And of course, the Alistar, very smart choice in this case, but of course, we could see something different. Got a few more seconds. What does Kasing prefer? Looks like.
I'm not getting excited until I see it locked in.
That's it.
All right, Ryu.
Fizz and an Alistair.
Opts for the Fizz in the mid lane. Saying, okay, Pepinero likes to play these skirmish heavy type of champions. He's played Diana. He might play the Echo. You know, he wants to duel with that Echo. Be nimble, be swift.
But yeah, let's see what Giants decide to close this one out with, because they've telegraphed quite a lot, of course, with the Eve lock in. The Echo is really no longer a flex option. They could, in theory, send it up top.
No, it's still a flex option.
Yeah, okay, and I guess the Ezreal is also. But I definitely have a feeling this is going mid.
I mean, it's likely it'll end up going mid, and that's what they want. You know, they just want Ryu to prepare for a mid pick, and if Pepinera has a counter to Fizz mid, then they can flex it up, and that's the power of a flex pick, obviously. But I feel, regardless of what Giants pick here, I feel there's a solid draft on the side of H2K. The only weakness you could potentially put out is the lack of wave clear in the mid lane. But knowing H2K, what they usually do is they find an opening in the game, they get an early tower, and then they swap Ryu to a side lane, and then they put Hjarn in mid, and then this allows Kasing to hover around the mid lane.
All right. I was wrong. It's top lane Echo. It's first person since Huni to do that here in Europe. We'll see if Wurlib can make that work. Audrey on the Vayne. Vayne Thresh versus Sivir Alistar.
Wins hard.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, should destroy that lane. So I wonder if we're going to see a preemptive swap from H2K and called by Giants here. Because Vayne Thresh should definitely have an advantage in that lane. Unless Gragas finds a flanker out, then you can punish the short range Thresh and Vayne. Especially when he's level 2. Gragas is already level 3 coming around. Mm-hmm. There are counterplay like options here.
And also, you know, like we were talking about last game, it also makes the Gnar a little bit less effective too for Odawame. So we'll see if Giants can make use of that. I feel like they do have strong lanes, strong picks across the board, but H2K are a smart team. They're a team that will not let themselves get put into bad situations as often as other teams will.
The thing is, if you back H2K into a corner, they usually have an answer ready. They don't go into the game with just one plan and think, if this works, we win. They know what their fail-safes are. They know if things goes wrong, what do we do? How do we react? You know, how do we sacrifice a lane that's losing? How do we get something back on the other side of the map? And they plan ahead with vision mostly, and with lane control, with manipulation of waves. And I think that will be enough for them to beat Giants. Giants coming out here with a bit of an unconventional composition.
Yep, well, Krepo thinks that will be enough for it, but what do you guys think at home? Why don't you go ahead and let us know? At LL Esports is the place. H2K win or GIA win are your tags. And the crowd, as fired up as they are, excited, stomping on the floor to get ready for game number 2, H2K versus Giants Gaming.
Let's go over a couple of these matchups here and see if we can figure out what the game plan is. I feel like the Gnar does well into Echo, though. Echo is a melee range champion. I feel like he can get bullied by Odawame's Gnar at the early levels. He does have some gap close potential. And if you look at the mid lane Fizz into Ezreal, a lot of poke from Pepinero that could potentially poke him out of the lane. But Ryu is strong enough a laner to deal with that. But the pressure will definitely be on Pepinero's side early. If you look to the bot lane, definitely winning matchup for Vayne and Thresh. Mm-hmm. So allows easy scaling.
Of course, Yarnan's no slouch on the Sivir. He has had some pretty seriously good numbers, averaging 6.7 on a KDA, which is, you know, it's not that much higher than the average for Sivir in general, but it's a strong pick, clearly, and he's done a lot of work with it.
Yeah, it doesn't matter how strong your Sivir is, though. You're just limited by your champions, because to connect really good damage, you need to use the Alistar combo offensively. As we see a little bit of poking going on here, level 1.
Well, Alistar makes a big target. Pepe is able to get a little bit of harass down onto him. So it's really just been kind of like a game of chicken right here through the river. They're just trying to feel out where everyone's
going. They're just getting some deep wards, so both these teams want to know what's going on and plan ahead, as we said before. H2K doesn't like being in the dark. Don't want to be randomly swapped upon. They're obviously playing against an Evelynn. Her strength initially was the fact that she was invisible and out of the meta. That's why Evelynn came back, because Evelynn puts up a lot of pressure on these lanes because nobody knows where she is. Unless you have wards on the camps, and she can gank from angles that you simply can't ward from. And the fact, additionally, that people weren't used to playing against her. Mm-hmm. Now that people are used to playing against her again, she kind of fell off and hasn't had a good showing, especially not when facing off against tier 1 junglers like Gragas.
Yeah, I'm curious to see what Frederick is able to do. But yeah, Kasing's going to walk onto that ward, so they know that that lane's happening. Do they now want to try to swap Aru back? But of course, H2K have eyes on Giants bot lane as well right now, but it looks like Giants aren't interested in taking the swap. They're going to be going down to take their normal places. Well, Godfrey's actually going on a bit of a roam early.
Yeah, see, this is what you usually do. If you get surprised by a swap, you give the and you're starting in camp, you give full XP to your support, get him level 2, facilitate a roam, especially on a melee ranged mid laner here with no escape other than the potentially the playful Trickster, but he doesn't have that yet.
He doesn't have it yet, indeed. Lulex and Oduwamne, though, are coming to the rescue. They took a break from the double jungle to save the life.
And that's the problem. H2K, they initiate the lane swap, so they start on their weak side of the jungle. Look at all the camps that are still available. For Oduwamne and Lulex here, double jungling. Giants kind of mirrored it too, though. They took down a similar camps on the top lane, so it's not too bad for them. However, it's getting pretty predictable right now. Both lanes are pushing. It's a 4v0. They wanted to dodge the Vayne with the Sivir, so H2K's plan is kind of working out. They initiated the lane swap, not because they wanted to find Giants in the top lane, but because they wanted to avoid them. So this speaks well for H2K, and they managed to get a good start.
Yeah, and Giants really didn't have an answer for this. They knew that Kassing was going up top.
They're going for a three-man defense here, but they're getting products. They're too late.
Yeah, this isn't looking good for Giants right now. Frederick's there. They're not going to know he is, but they have to know something is up because otherwise Wurlib and Godfrey would not be checking.
They're not going to get it.
It's not going to go. He gets a little late on the play, and now they're just diving way past the tower as Frederick reveals himself. Oduwamne and the rest of the team turn their attention that way. Tower defense not quite working so well for Giants right now.
I have yet to see this work.
Oh boy!
Female pulverized!
Sting! Oh man, that was a brilliant play in first blood over to Yharnam. Oh boy.
E-flash from Lulex, three-man pulverize from Kassing, and as I was saying, I've yet to see this work where three members try to sneak in and defend against the opposing four. This is why 4v0 is such a common lane swap meta game right now because it's so hard to counter. If you want to counter it, hang on, Frederick, you have to get underneath that tower before they show up. That's what you need to do. You need to get in that tower with three people, and then you can possibly defend the dive against four people. But if you get caught in the lane, you get proxied. Use momentum, and there's no more counterplay.
They keep trying to get in there and defend it, but they couldn't do anything. They give up one instead. They manage to basically just waste time. And now H2K get out for free.
And that's the problem. Yeah, they're getting flanked upon right now, but Frederick has to face it through a brush, so he might just get blown up immediately.
Frederick Kassing, they baited him out. And Frederick's going down. Kassing gets the kill. Wurlib and Godfrey aren't done yet, but they've got to back away again. They can't get it done.
And this is the point I've been trying to make. If Giants let me without face checking too much, is that there is not, once you go in for that move, there's no fallback, there's no counterplay if you get caught. They got proxied, and the only counterplay they had was walk back all the way to the bottom side of the map, and that loses them so much time that they have to keep committing for this play, keep trying to force something, and now they find themselves 1,700 gold behind.
And what have they gotten for
five
it?
5 minutes.
Audrey's got free farm.
That's it.
I mean, yeah, okay, so he's got a 7 or 8 CS lead on Yharnam. Big whoop, he's got a first blood.
He doesn't care. His Sivir. He can be 20 CS down. He doesn't care at all. Mm-hmm. That's the only saving grace right now for Giants. Level 6 Vayne, eventually somebody will have to match her. She's 5 now, but she'll eventually get level 6 and then have an experience advantage. With proper wave control, you could go for an all-in, but knowing H2K, they will just send Lulex to shadow that lane and defend. And Ryu, he got bombed on early, but you wouldn't tell.
Yeah, he didn't have too much of a problem at all since Lulex and Oduwamne were there to help him out. Now Kassing makes a move with Lulex, and Epi is forced back. Yharnam perfectly happy to just farm this one out. He's not going to need to deal with Audrey. Yes, he's a level down, but I don't think he's too worried about that one.
This seems to be a recurring thing against Giants, or just any team with a relatively young shot caller. They do okay in standard lanes because that's close to solo queue and games are predictable, but once you start lane swapping and you get surprised by the lane swap, Giants were not expecting this lane swap.
No, clearly not, and they didn't react to it properly at all, especially considering how much we talked about how well they win that 2v2.
Then the shot calling starts faltering, and we saw it. Three man up top to try to sneak into the tower, but in full vision, they get punished. Mm-hmm. And I said it earlier, we have the Vayne. That's a strong point. That's the number one priority for Giants here. So Lulex, he recognizes that. He says, okay, Oduwamne, you play safe. Ryu, you play safe. I will just shadow my lane, defend, and group on the tower. And we do this as long as we need to equalize this lane because all the rest of the map is winning and we have an advantage.
And we're already starting to see that even up too. Yharnam is not really falling any further behind in the farm game.
He's
starting to close the gap. Ryu now moving with Lulex to look for a dive. Let's see if they do it to teleport
in as well. This is so beautiful.
All in. Go, Audrey. He gets the lane. He stopped in the mid. That's the pulverize. Odo comes over the wall. Godfrey desperately trying to keep him alive, but Audrey's gonna fall to Oduwamne. H2K with a 5-man stack on bot.
I just love how H2K managed to put their opponents into positions where they have no more counterplay. Nothing Giants could do at that moment could save them.
Godfrey tried for the hero to save, but it just wasn't enough. H2K took everything from him there. they've got themselves a well-earned lead in this game.
Because they think so far ahead, right? They're continuously two steps ahead of Giants right now, and Giants, once they realize what's coming, it's too late. Teleport already landed. The Singh was already flanking. Even if Audrey survives, he has to burn all his summers, he loses his tower, and he was the one ahead, and right now he's the one behind as well.
And all that was enabled by just the prior planning, the deep warding. Let's take a look at how this one went again. Massive stop here. Boom!
He predicts that the lantern is going to be clicked, and that's hard to do because that's predictively, that is not reactively. Because if you have to wait for the lantern to get into motion and then press Q, it's often too late to knock him out, but he just knows either you click the lantern right now or you will die in my pulverize anyways. The Singh presses Q and beautiful.
Yeah, Giants get absolutely nothing for that either. They were just trying, scrambling to try and make something happen. As it stands, they've got themselves in a hole to start this game. H2K ahead, a little under 2,000. And you can see the fan vote tilting in their favor, and there's a reason why.
Yeah, Kjarnan still doesn't really want to deal with Audrey right now. So they swap him back up top. He doesn't want to get that duel against the Vayne matchup. Just wants to push in. Singh doesn't have a sightstone yet, just has a couple of wards, so I imagine he'll place him safely, allow Kjarnan to push, and then let Kjarnan group on mid. Kjarnan's ranged into melee, has the support of his support, so he'll push in, and then they can rotate again, free up that resource. And meanwhile, Odwamne, he can hold his own at some farm against the Vayne, as long as he's under his tower.
Yeah, so H2K have been pretty much all over the map doing exactly what they need to, but Giants, I feel like they're still trying to lane, and that's just not going to fly. H2K will shove them all over the place, and I feel like this game will continue to spiral out of control if Giants do not take proactive steps to cover up the gaping holes in their strategy.
Yeah, and H2K, speaking of covering up, we see what the opportunity cost of that play on the bot was, though. Odwamne is down. Big amount of CS and some experience, and H2K is playing like a team, letting him catch up, you know? So they sent him bottom, get that free wave on their tower safely. Can't go wrong. Then they just go up top, push it in really quickly. Keep the Echo busy, and then they group on Odwamne again. They let him farm a little bit with them. Let him catch up. They don't leave their weak members exposed. If somebody is behind in a 1v1, they group on him. Or in a 2v2, we saw that. They were behind in the bot lane, so they sent in Lulex.
Yes, they did. They sent in Odwamne as well. Teleport coming in. Audrey, he's going to be ganged up on, knocked up, knocked against the wall. They take him down. Giants a little slow to react as the teleport comes in from Wurlip. He's trying to save the day. Yarnin and Odo are being pushed back from Godfrey, but they turn their attention over to Frederick. The True Shot Barrage doesn't do a thing. Wurlip now. We've seen this before. Chrono breaks back in. H2K are low, but will they be able to get the kills? Frederick, he's going. He's gone. And so is Wurlip. Wait a minute. No, he flashed away. I got juked. And he's still down.
Singh is going to leave up that kill too. What a support player.
Oh,
oh Trample takes it.
No.
He wanted to give it away, but Trample takes it. Bloodthirsty.
He tried.
Noah would be proud. Making it look like an accident.
But making it look easy too. 6-1 in the kills. Every time Giants try to react, they're two steps behind.
Let's watch this again. Again, they're playing on Odwamne, who was behind, but hits his power spike on the ulti. Good flash by Godfrey. Dodges both body slam and knock back from Lulex, but it's not enough, because once Audrey gets stunned into wall, he's dead. Now look at Ryu. Even though he's playing melee into ranged, he's still the first one showing up. This indicates that there's a lot of free planning on the side of H2K. Garnon flashes out. He gets preemptively to dodge that two-shot barrage. And Rolo gets a good ulti, but it's too little too late. Frederick drops, and while he still takes down Garnon. Now let's see this, Kasing. I want the kill, but how do I make it look like an accident? That's how. Oh, oops, Trample. I was just trying to save you, Lulex.
300 gold. Nice and easy. Giants, however, are looking to take advantage of the moment and grab themselves Dragon number one. They do secure it a little earlier than their average, I might add, but H2K, they're not too worried about that.
Yeah, but they take the Dragon, so H2K respect that, so they immediately send in Kasing. Watch where he is right now. He's on the top side of the map. He knows there were at least four people involved in a Dragon, so puts up some deep vision in Giants' red side jungle, and then transition into the mid lane. So they're going to take that tower while Odwamne just distracts them on the bottom. If they go tier 1 for tier 1, H2K will just keep going because their left flank is warded, so they can always lean left. Giants can't push on because they don't have enough vision to do so.
I think it looks to collapse here.
They might actually
just do that. Godfrey's looking to join Audrey and Wurlip, get the lantern throw out.
So many group fights with
their
Sivir.
Behind them. Wurlip now jumped on by Odwamne. Lulex comes on in. The Echo is isolated, and they should be able to take him down. Yes, he jumps in, gets the heal, gets the AoE, but it won't be enough as Odwamne picks him up again.
How many times have we seen H2K group? You know, you're wondering, look at the scores. Odwamne involved in every kill. Lulex, 5 out of 7. Kjarnan, 6 out of 7.
It's a team that plays together.
Kasing, 6 out of 7. Poor little Ryu, 1 out of 7. But he's doing his job. He's keeping Pepinera, the one-man carry from formerly from Giants, at a 0-0-0 score. Even CS.
We said this in Champs Select, though, too. Ryu is a guy who can carry. That's not always what HK need him to do. More often than not, it's not. And he plays it exactly the way he needs to.
And yeah, as we see, the largest goal lead of the split so far at 12 minutes by H2K against Giants, we see how that manifested. Good macro play, good map movements, and Ryu neutralizing that threat in the mid lane and still managing to move first. Every roam, every step they take, good Ryu grouping. Was there to make it first. And we say what you have to do, Coop with Sivir and their Donzo, as the meme goes, but...
Well, so far, it's working.
It worked.
They don't even have a huge amount of damage just yet, but they just have superior positioning. They have almost pre-recognition of this game. Giants Gaming have just not been able to get hardly anything done. A dragon, maybe. Stemming the gold lead, that's going to be a little harder.
World Up goes back in time, but H2K, they think ahead of time. They always know what's going to come. They're predicting Giants pretty well so far.
It's not a great time machine if it only goes one direction, Krempo. Yeah. Ryo's taking a bit of damage from Audrey here. Alexa's still there for defense, though. Giants are... they're cowed a little bit. They can't really make any plays for fear of H2K rotating on them.
Yeah, they're definitely holding back right now. And this gold lead is big. As we said it before, it's probably the biggest one we've had. It actually is the biggest one we've had so early in the game. And H2K, early on the analyst desk, when we were opening the show, our panel of experts and Cyanide said how H2K actually had a seemingly weak early game. Stats did show that they had the most gold lead at 10 minutes, and I think we're starting to see why.
And they usually turn that into something big here to see if they can keep it going as Frederick is forced to take the Thresh Express. Boomerang goes pretty far to hit Frederick in the back of the head, however. And now H2K turn their attention up to the top side.
Look at the wards they leave behind. They move into the jungle, they force them out, drop some vision right here. And then they can... this is step one. Step two is pushing both lanes adjacent to those wards, and then facilitate rotations, you know. Push in top and say, okay, can we get this tower? No, let's just move to the mid lane, push in mid. Watch Ryu, they're grouping again.
H2K
constantly grouping, but they're going for the Fnatic pickoff.
Yeah, there's the parallel convergence. Zol is revealed, and it won't hit anybody.
Now they can dive with Alistar. Alistar has Unbreakable Will, so he can tank that tower for at least 6 seconds without dying.
Let's see if they decide to go for it right now. Sweeping out, they know the ward's there. Lulek's hanging in the brush, seeing if they can test the waters with this one. It looks like they're thinking about going in. Tower's already being fired down.
They don't even have to dive.
They're backing away.
They just show Giants, hey, we have a cow here. Move out of the way, or bad things will happen. And yes, Vayne gets free farm on the bottom, but they lose the tower in the top. And they'll do the same thing over and over again. They just detonate Giants. They don't even have to make the move. They say, do you really want to get dove right now? No, move away. Give us the tower.
Giants are furiously trying to get this Vayne up into a comfortable situation, up into the scaling part of the game, but it's 15 minutes in. The gold lead is so massively out of their control. It's up over 5,000 gold. That Vayne's never going to get to a point where it's powerful enough to do anything.
I mean, never say never. But unlikely.
Definitely looking less likely as it goes on.
All right, so we took stock of the situations. We talked about how H2K got here. The question we have to ask is, what is Giants going to do to come back? And I think the answer lies in what we saw in the top lane. Try and find a pickoff somehow. You know, Frederick is, for the most part, invisible. Unless he walks over those pink wards like he did just now.
Yeah.
Pepinera is still ramping up. No Mura mana, just has a Sheen, so he's poking, but... he needs a whole lot of poke. Stop HTK from coming over.
I really have wanted to look at what Wurlib is gonna be able to do on this Echo. The problem is he's been set so far behind. Yes, he's leading in CS, and that was, you know, our story earlier because Oduwamne was more involved in the lanes, but what is he really going to be able to do? Just throw out a little bit of harass.
Yeah, you say it right there, he's still ahead in CS, and earlier we were talking about how Wurlib was 40 CS ahead, but HTK, they took a problem and they made it into a solution. They sent Oduwamne down in the bot lane, buddy system. I used him for a teleport to get bot lane ahead, then later on the bot lane covered him, allowed him to safely farm, get experience, get assists in those kills, and then he came back. He's now strong enough to deal with Echo on his own. He has the pressure, especially in the mid lane. Ryu now splitting in the bot lane, signature HTK move. Almost every game they send Ryu to split, move Yharn to the middle, and then Kasing and Lulex can group up as his dynamic vision duo. They can double sidestone. And now HTK can see everything that's going on the map, and if they have the knowledge of what's going on, it's incredibly hard, if not impossible, unless you're Fnatic, to really surprise H2K.
Waters comes out, goes a little bit wide. Audrey looks for Ryu, playful and trickster to get away. There's the barrel. Audrey into them. Maybe they can turn it around. He's able to get out of the area, but they've turned their attention to Godfred, Frederick, and Wurlip now. H2K have already taken out Godfred, however. In comes the Echo, and Ryu's going to flash away. Everybody is bailing out. Odawamne's going down, shut down by the Vayne finally, but looks like they might lose a tower here. It's only Pepe and Audrey here to defend Kreppo.
Yeah, this is about as good as it's going to get for Giants. Fish goes wide, Vayne pops ulti, gets knocked in, doesn't get insta-gib, picks up a shutdown, but even then, even fight, one for one, but tower yet again on the side of H2K. And imagine if Giants won that fight. Two kills, three kills. Even then, all they could have picked up is maybe a dragon. H2K looking to
secure their first death
reap what they sowed as well. And fantastic pressure. Look at all the wards that are littered in that jungle. H2K is just so far ahead. They're playing on Giants' side. Yeah, let's watch that again. So fish go wide. Unlucky. Or dodge masterfully. Good barrel here by Lulex.
They all pick up Audrey.
Yeah, good Cadyman count. The Q flash from Kasing barely misses, so this allows Echo to enter the fight, and he's wreaking havoc in the backline. He'll eventually ulti backwards. Ryu predicts that and lands on top of him. Odawamne goes in for a one for one, you know, getting that top lane supremacy. Sometimes it's okay to flash into a fight and get a kill if you can kill your direct opponent. It's not about the gold, it's not about the values, it's more about the message you send.
The message H2K is sending right now is we are stronger than you in every way possible. The gold lead remains pretty massively in their favor. Let's see what Kasing can do, but Giants going to carve themselves off the side of beef. Won't be getting it today.
You just moved out of the way. I went there.
Yeah.
It's so one-sided, I have to make.
Yep. You got it.
Terrible fun.
Okay, thanks, Free.
All right, let's,
H2K.
Let's see how they close.
It's kind of a weird thing to say that at 19 minutes, but this is a team that does, in the mid-game, tend to get rolling, and with a massive lead, it should logically extend that they just are able to shove Giants in. But what can Giants really do here to stop this from happening? So far, it doesn't seem like anything.
Make picks. It's incredibly hard to counter H2K, as we've been saying, so we might as well just highlight what they're doing instead of keep talking about how hard it is to counter what they're doing. Maybe right now, he gets caught a little bit in the mid lane, but he dashes out. If he sees them coming and creeps to his assistance, he can always Q dash out, then pop his playful tricks to get out of there. And whenever they aggress on Ryu in the mid lane, Kasing and Lulex are putting up vision constantly together, constantly moving as a buddy system. So all these lanes from H2K are incredibly adept at dodging ganks. Odawamne is safe in the top lane, Ryu safe in the mid, if not bot lane, and then Kjarnan is shadowed by his jungle support bodyguards, as if it is. And they just constantly put vision in between the lanes. Then they go back to deny the vision that Giant snuck in. Whether it's through time, after 3 minutes these wards just expire, or through sweepers, then the objectives are dark. Then H2K can do two things, bait or just do them.
Give themselves options all throughout the game. And yeah, Giants, they're running out of those options as their own vision has just been ebbed away throughout this game. They're trying to stack on towers to stay alive. This 1-3-1 split push is working well for them. Wurlip now, he's going to have to back away. This is going to buy some time for H2K on the top side to keep pushing in. The Fizz is still pretty much uncontested. Pepinero, we got to talk about him because for a guy that has a reputation for carrying these games on this Ezreal, he's done almost nothing.
Yeah, but he's playing against Ryu, who does exactly what he has to do, is just neutralize pets. Either he does it by picking the Lulu and going for
quadra kills.
For the utility mid laner that ends up getting a crazy quadra kill. Either he picks the TF we saw last week. He says, Fox is a threat. I will jump in every fight, lock him down, get him killed. I will die in the process, but my team will win the fight. And now he picks Fizz, controls the lane beautifully, and always roams first. Very consistent.
Yes, indeed. And there's really just no answer that Giants have for him. So with Pepe being shut down too, though, like what exactly do Giants have other than the Vayne?
Not much at this point. And look at how that tower went down. We had this one frame right there where Odawamne was on the top left, Ryu was on the top right in full vision. While there were three members on that tower, and that's the way H2K always close middle towers. 1-3-1 push, push in the middle. Tell Giants, if you're going to defend, look on your left. Odawamne's flanking you. Look on your right. Ryu's flanking you. Please back off. Give us a tower. You back up into your jungle. Look at the vision from Giants. The farthest one of their wards go is the first brush in their jungle. That's it. That's all they have. Now they have to send in Frederick, rather, on a panic mission to get the Scuttlecraft just to buy some time.
And just to see if H2K are going to dare this Baron. So Ryu now has spotted him. He'll be able to get away. Hopefully, we would think this playful trickster over.
See, and the respect. He gives enough respect to Frederick that there might be an Echo in that brush. There might be a Thresh in that brush. No endless chase. No need for that. Slow and calculated play for H2K, but with enough tempo to keep it exciting.
Well, they don't take unnecessary risks. This is the thing. H2K, they're a team that
you'll never catch them with their pants down, it seems.
Rarely. Even,
very, very rarely. Like, maybe somebody will get caught out. Maybe you can get a pick on them. Giants are certainly hoping for that. But H2K is the team that covers their behinds. They know that that won't amount to that much.
And look at the side lanes just to clear. They focus on vision right now. They don't want to start this Baron because massive side wave in the bottom. They send old Wama to go there. He has teleport. I think Ryu will end up going top here. So Hyannon rather, excuse me, can stay in the mid lane and push that wave clear that wave. And Kasing and Lulix are still together. They're like conjoined twins almost. I've rarely seen them walk on their own. Full on buddy system here right now. And it's working.
Yep. That was that vision game. There's four pink wards around the dragon. Yeah, they can't clear the Scuttle Shrine, but they can just wait till it goes away. Another dragon's a minute away, so they could turn their attention down the bottom side. Giants, however, getting a little bit bold, trying to shove out the mid. The problem is the side waves are pushing
against
him here.
Ryu collapses after pushing out that wave. He's not split pushing any further because he knows he can collapse on himself then. He zones Giants back out of the jungle. He doesn't let them go in, and now they hop over the wall. Look for a cheeky little Baron. I think Frederick will spot that out eventually.
See if they're able to secure it, though.
Odo Omne.
Going pretty
low.
Teleport. Godfrey's here. There's the teleport from Odo. They're going to look to try and catch. Godfrey's forced to flash away. Chum the Waters lands on him. He's going to look to chase this down as the box comes in. He's just popped by Yharnam.
Oh.
Frederick caught up and pinballed around the map. H2K, easy two kills. And it's going to be right back to Baron for them.
And Lulix has been the best Gragas I've seen at these body slam flashes. You start the body slam animation, and when it's about to end, you flash forward, and you still connect and knock up. Hasn't missed a single one since. Gragas has been nerfed in the LCS and has played it quite a bit.
Aerial
convergence.
It's just going to buy a little bit of time for Giants.
No
smite. Will they really be able to do this?
No.
There's a smite for Lulix. They don't have anything else. And Audrey knocked back by the Gnar. Ryu picks him up. Whirlip. Chrono breaks to keep himself alive, but it won't be for long as Ryu secures a double while Lulix and Yharnam get the Baron. H2K get everything in that.
Zero hesitation by H2K. Perfectly controlled. And the crowd,
they love him.
They love it. I'm loving it.
It's hard not to right now, Crepo.
Let's take stock and just highlight.
13-2. Not even 25 minutes. They are 14,000 gold in the lead. That is absolutely insane.
And just to illustrate how they do it, first pick Sivir. Right? That indicates what they want to do. They want to group with it, use on a hunt to their advantage, and get objectives. And play as a team. And then if you look at the scoreline, Kasing involved in 12 out of 13 kills. Hyannon involved in 11 out of 13 kills. Odo Omne, 11 out of 13 kills as well. So fantastic group participation there.
They just know when to group, where to group, and how to do it. And it goes beyond, you know, group up with Sivir and press R. These guys are thinking not two steps ahead, not three steps ahead. They're thinking four steps ahead.
Yeah, and Lulex
although
saying, I have big boy carry pants
wearing
on.
Lots of belts.
Yeah, so big are these carry pants that I need two belts to hold them up.
Hey, Gragas
big
boy.
He did lose some weight on that body slam particle.
Not enough, though.
Yeah, not enough, but enough to warrant an extra belt. You may want to go for the suspender combo eventually, as the young Monte Cristo taught me. Here we go for a pickoff.
Oh, Ryu. He's going to go golden for just a second. Throws the fish out onto Audrey. Whirlip is going to get baited this one. Knocked into the wall. Audrey, it's the final hour, and he's looking to try to keep this one alive for Giants as Lulex is finally chunked down. Whirlip will secure a kill. That's the third for Giants. But yeah, H2K, immediate response, no reaction. Odo's going to be able to shove this in for free.
That's exactly what they want to do. They sacrifice one, but they trade every death for an objective. Giants. So thirsty for blood, they say, I really don't care about inhibitors. Who needs them anyways? Free farm coming our way. They pick up Lulex, but not enough.
Powered recall, then back to base. Nice and spend that gold, that massive gold they've got weighing those pockets down of theirs. H2K just continue to shove Giants further and further back. I mean, they've gotten themselves a little deeper vision, but not a whole lot. Giants can't really do anything right here.
I almost feel like a bit of a broken record every time I cast an H2K game, because it's always the same, or a lot of the same. And that's why I think they're such a nice team to watch and progress over time, because they're perfecting this style, which many may claim, you know, is the way to play League of Legends, you know, calculated objective control, not overly dwelling in the chaos, you know, getting those rotations. I'm sure there's a certain caster out there that does love that. And they're constantly getting better at it. Thursday, one step ahead, two steps ahead, three steps ahead. And it just makes me so excited for next week. Fnatic against H2K. I really want to see that game.
A lot of people have speculated that that's really just going to be the one to watch because the two styles are just so smart. But H2K's got to close this one out first in order for that to happen. Gnar's not going to connect, but it doesn't even matter. That inhibitor's going
flanking.
So low. Frederick, yeah, you can't flank on this team. They're way too big. Chum the Waters comes out on Pepinero. He's just going to pull him right back into it. And now H2K are just going to say, let's take the fight. Everyone from Giants are absolutely melting. Wurlip outside of his own base, and H2K can just take their time about this one, Crepo.
H2K make the Giants look small, and they're looking for the final push here on the Nexus.
See if they can do it. The mini wave starting to lose a little bit. Wurlip taking his chances with Oda Wamne, but what chance did he have? Absolutely none. One inhibitor down in the top. H2K methodical yet again can keep backing away, pushing in again, taking everything away, and strangling Giants out of their own base.
60-4. We're only 20 minutes in, which is relatively early. Start looking to close out a game, but that's the game I used to get. Let's watch that again. Fredrik started off with the flank. That's what Evelynn has to do if you're even. It's what you have to try when you're behind. It's what's going to fail if you're this far behind. Fish connects, Pepinero, Quadra Fish. Yeah. Don't always click the lantern, kids. It's dangerous. Yeah, time rewind, and then Oda Wamne goes on a hunt. Says, okay, guys, you got this. I want to kill my my other half. Again, send that message. Gnar is better than Echo.
Clearly Oda Wamne is making that statement right here. So 28 minutes into the game, it's been very one-sided for H2K. Giants have been thirsty for blood, though. They've tried to get a little bit back, although they've only been able to secure 4 kill spread on themselves. That's as many times as Audrey's died this game.
Yeah, and something I want to see at the end of this game is just how much damage Garen has been putting out in these fights, because Sivir's always lauded as this utility carry with not too much damage mid to early, but good damage in AoE late game team fights because, yeah, Ricochet, Boomerang Blade. But Hjarn's build has no armor penetration because they're so far ahead that Giants haven't had the chance to build any armor, really. So he Forsaken, or hasn't built the Lost Whisper Rotter. Just went for triple damage items, now building it, so
he can take his time.
Definitely interested to see how much damage he actually put out and what is how it related to his team. Because he's definitely a carry.
For H2K, it looks to be all they need to do, closing out nice and safe, not taking those risks, just do everything that they've been doing all game long.
So they're waiting for the minions to come in from the top lane, and Ryu has done this before so many times. You see him E into the wave, give Giants the idea that they can catch him, and then he just queues out every time. And he's putting the side lane pressure. Look at the top lane as well. There's a massive minion wave stacking up.
Yeah. They don't need to send anybody there.
That's H2K's time window, right when that wave hits the tower. They wait 10 seconds, 20 seconds, and then Giants have to back off or get caught.
And it looks like it's going to be both right now as Frederick is knocked into the wall, trying to shield himself up. He's gone down. Yarnin will pick him up. In comes Oda Wamne to Gnar, Wurlip, and Audrey back. He'll give his life for the effort, and Godfrey's going down. Ryu jumps back in, erases time. And erases the time for Giants to try and stay alive in this one. Double kill goes over to Yarnin. It ends up being a 4-for-1. Maybe they're not done yet. Pepe knocked in. Triple kill to Yarnin. That's going to be it. 30 and a half minutes into the game. The Nexus turrets are no match. And H2K take down Giants. Absolutely dominant.
H2K, A-OK. Fantastic victory.
That look on Kasing's face. That is
Kasing.
That is the game.
Just love that
in a nutshell. But the whole team did their job to this game. It was completely in sync with each other.
Yeah, just clean. I love, out of all the teams in the European LCS, I think HK is one of my personal favorites to watch. Mm-hmm. Just in terms of their style and their methodical approach. And just, I get all excited when I see them walk up to the top lane and just play that 4v0 out and just realize what's going on. They don't need much time to figure out what Giants are doing. Giants showed up with one or two members in that top lane early game lane swap, if you go back all the way to the start, and H2K knew Evelynn was there too, and they said, okay, you guys are not getting to this tower. We're not letting you enter. You shall not pass.
Yeah, H2K do this better than anyone else, pretty much. I mean, maybe the argument can be made for Fnatic, but we're going to have to wait till next week to find that out.
Yeah, that might actually be a little more, even more exciting, because all our eyes were always on Origin and Fnatic, but
yeah,
kind of forgot about H2K.
Well, and at this point, I forgot a little bit about Giants. They started out so well, but now they've just dropped so many in a row.
And probably must be happy. Had a pen explode in his hands. Mm-hmm. Covered in ink earlier today, but had a sheer amount of...
Final preparations on stage are the 2-5 Copenhagen Wolves and the 7-0 Fnatic.
So let's dive right into that matchup, of course. Bringing it in on the blue side, it will be the Copenhagen Wolves. That means in the top lane, we've got Youngbuck, Airwax in the jungle, Soar in the mid, Freeze the AD carry, Unlimited their support, and their coach, Dentist. Of course, this is a team that it definitely seemed like they've got a little bit of work to do still, Crepo.
And a lot of work to do, because they're facing Fnatic, who are on the red side. Look at their roster. In the top lane, we have Huni. And later in the jungle, Rainover, mid lane Fevevin, Reckless, former AD carry, Yellowstar in the support, and then Fantastic, their coach Daylor, always solid and always in for a good drafting phase.
Poker, former poker player, poker guy, he's always taking calculated risks, and it seems like it's always paid off.
High expected value is what he
says. And they get him back almost every single time. Yep. So far, it's worked out for him. But for Copenhagen Wolves, it's been a little bit less certain. Yesterday, they looked a little bit lost in that lane swap against H2K. They didn't really have much they were able to get done, and that was kind of the problem for them.
Yeah, they were down a lot of gold in that lane swap, and this guy right here as well, Youngbuck, he kind of got really far behind. He had a really big deficit around 8 minutes into the game. He kind of closed it out towards the 10-minute mark, but even then, he was down 26 CS, and this was the highest deficit we've seen all split. And it showed, yes, he had the power pick and the rise, but it just wasn't enough. He got set behind, got snowballed upon, and they couldn't stop the bleeding to get that Jace in the mid lane going.
Yeah, the Echo didn't really help them out quite as much either. So power picks, not able to do much. That's kind of the issue. They got outplayed on a micro level, on a macro level. You know, they couldn't do much. And now they're against a team that has even tighter holes to try and open up.
Yeah, they lost against H2K yesterday for people that weren't aware. Now they face all Fnatic, very similar in the strategic approach to the game. Also very similar in their just sheer amount of skill. You know, if you look at that roster, they have fantastic mechanics across the board. I would maybe even argue that the only person lacking a little bit of mechanics, that's my own personal opinion here, is Yellowstar. But what he may or may not lack, he makes up by far by the amount of shot calling and veteran leadership he brings to the table. Fantastic support player. That's why he's been for so long the best support player in Europe, because it doesn't matter, you know, what you do in your laning phase necessarily, because he transcends that and he brings that out on the Rift and he just leads that completely new Fnatic squad to number one spot so far.
Yeah, he's a very, very proactive player. Not only is he making those calm calls, making sure everyone is following him, but also what he does, he doesn't necessarily need to lane that much. He's roving around, he's making plays, he's setting things up. The Wolves will really have to pull out all the stops to deny anything away from Fnatic today. It's a tough task, but they're maybe feeling a little bit more confident these days. Let's see what happens with them as we get ready to get into picks and bans.
I wonder what their approach to the game will be actually today for the Copenhagen Wolves. Are they going to just try and match Fnatic in what they're strong? Or will they bring in some of these unconventional picks? Some people like to call it cheese. Mm-hmm. I like to call it diverse strategy. No, actually, I call it cheese anyways.
Yeah, could be both, right?
They've been having the issue where the guy on the far right there earlier, Freeze, he was their main threat. You know, he was the one-man carry because Soren was kind of falling back a little bit. Youngbuck always had a pretty hard time. Traditionally, was just put on tanks. And yeah, it's getting rough for them to survive because it's really easy to identify somebody as a single carry, as a single threat, and then shut them down. And we saw HTK did it earlier today as well. If the Vayne is a threat, five-man dive him. You know, if Freeze is a threat, we might see Fnatic do the same.
Yeah, this is the problem that the Wolves have had since the start of the split. So they, you know, they didn't change anyone on their roster, and they just sort of presumed that they'd still be able to rely on Soren and Freeze and maybe be able to go even everywhere else, but it just hasn't been the case. They haven't really lived up to the somewhat improved Wolves that we saw between the summer split of 2014 and now, and it seems like they're falling back into bad habits, back into bad patterns, and that doesn't bode well for them trying to make a playoff run.
Yeah, it definitely doesn't bode well. Obviously, they're facing Fnatic right here, so let's be honest. Expected is a loss, and Fnatic is expected is a win, but often in these matches where it's so clear, you have to be careful, you know, because you don't want to slip up and give away this, you know, on paper, relatively easy victory, because it would mean so much for the Wolves.
Yeah,
momentum they could get out of one victory here could mean a lot.
That's the thing that you don't always think about when a team is so heavily favored against another, the mental factor. There's no pressure really on the Wolves because no one expects them to win this. Whereas for Fnatic, if you let that get inside your head, you can make mistakes and they can end up, you know, costing them the game, costing them a whole lot in the beginning. So we'll see what happens as we get loaded up. We're about to head into picks and bans. We'll see with the Wolves on the blue side what they decide to take away first. It is the Hecarim away from Huni.
You say it right there. Complacency can come to bite you in the butt, but Fnatic, expect them to just straight up ban the Draven and
no reason
get rid of that. And it seems like one of the teams the least likely to get, you know, complacent because they have that veteran leadership in Yellowstar, and then they also have that fantastic coach in Daylor. and just a whole heap of talent in their roster.
Yep, there is the Rumble ban as well. So the trend continues of trying to target ban the Huni.
So many bans.
But he still manages to find these picks. If they leave Echo open, the Ryze is banned now. It could be first pick. Airwax prefers it, but still, let's see what Fnatic bans away. There's the Kalista. So now Sivir becomes a very, very popular pick. Will they abandon Huni to having to delve even deeper into his champion pool, or will the Wolves let him have the Echo?
Who knows, honestly, but I just want to highlight yet again, it seems so common, but triple ban on Huni, take away one of his champions.
Four.
Four champions challenged on Huni, and usually you see top laners have to dig deep here, but Huni, he could easily play...
But they get Sivir Alistar out of this.
Yeah, he could easily play Maokai, he could easily play Gnar later, and Fnatic opening with a, you know, a signature draft of a team that likes to play, you know, strategic type of gameplay. Early Sivir, just like we saw H2K do. Kasing would have maybe here went Thresh, but Yellowstar says, we'll do the job on Alistar. Later on, Rainover is likely to pick a tank. Both tier 1 junglers always stay up against Fnatic. This is one thing that always tends to happen. Even though you could pressure that jungle pool by banning one, forcing them to ban another, you can't because all your bans have to go to Huni. And then Rainover, in almost every single game, gets either Gragas or Rek'Sai.
And they'll do it again here. We've got both of them open. We know that Echo is actually more preferred for Airwax, so unless they want to switch things up and send it on Youngbuck, Rainover has his pick of the jungle.
Yeah, and I just pinged our stats guy and asked him just how many times have people banned out Huni? 21 in 8 games. 21 bans he's drawn personally in 8 games. That is incredible. I think that's unprecedented almost, and it's not like Fnatic is the Huni show, right?
Anyone can really do this.
But I wonder when people will start stopping to do that and try and target the different champion pool. Maybe hit Rainover, because he is the one that ties it all together for me. He's the glue for Fnatic.
But now it hasn't happened. And Copenhagen Wolves are going to grab the Morgana for Unlimited. Also, the Jace comes into play against Sorin. Managed to not do too much on it, I would say, but it was a rough game for the Wolves all around. Let's see what Fnatic want to do here.
They're setting up a bit of a poke composition on the Copenhagen Wolves. However, Fnatic already has the hard engage to stop that. Usually, this is where you see Rainover pick up the Rek'Sai. Seems to prefer that over to Gragas.
Can tunnel it.
He might want some hard engage. Yeah, he can wait too, but he did favor that Olaf yesterday.
Clearly he's favoring it over that
with the Sivir
tier junglers. I can see why this is really useful, because Olaf can run at you really fast in this composition.
And he can just walk into the poke as well, you know, pop that Ragnar, get the wild go from Lulu, get the on the hunt from Reckless right there, and then become that one man axe throwing army. Has to keep snowballing though. Initially, Olaf is pretty squishy, even though he looks like the big menacing tank coming in, but you can definitely take him down quickly.
You can't lock him down, and when he's low, he is a very, very threatening champion all around, and a lot of teams aren't used to playing against him. When Rainover brought it out in the spring split, it was quite unexpected. It led Fnatic, who at that time were very untested, to a huge series of victories. They also take the Lulu, so this is going to go over to Feb. It's possible it goes over to Huni. I suppose it's still that flex pick.
We don't really know
at this point where Huni's going to go to, but
traditionally,
they don't seem too worried
about it. Given the style of Fnatic, it's incredibly likely that the Lulu will end up in the mid lane. Doesn't strike me as too much of a Huni champion. I'm sure he can play it.
Look at this.
It's better.
Wolves. There's no tank. They go for the Vlad. They take the Caitlyn for freeze.
Yeah.
So it should be Vlad top.
So they have the part of a very, very strong poke siege comb, right?
But if they get dove.
Caitlyn, yeah, just can't get dove. Caitlyn Jace is incredibly potent at taking down towers, so that's what we need to see. You know, early pressure in the lane. Caitlyn outranges Sivir. Might prompt the lane swap from Fnatic. See if the Copenhagen Wolves can call that, because Vladimir in the lane swap doesn't do too well. So that's number one objective for Copenhagen Wolves. Match that lane. Caitlyn Morgana should be able to destroy Alistar Sivir. Double range advantage, CC advantage, and just more raw damage on that lane. So definitely, that's what the Copenhagen Wolves, they want this 2v2.
And for Fnatic, you put Febivin.
Interesting.
Victor into his hands. That means we will have a Lulu top. So safe choice for Huni. May take a backseat on the damage this game, but then again, as Ryu proved the other day, the other week,
I like
still get big picks.
I like his draft from Copenhagen Wolves, except the Vladimir pick. Not too big of a fan. I feel like you're putting too many eggs in the scaling basket as well, and if you miss your lane swap...
Well, Gnar was up, Maokai was up. I mean, they could have...
Exactly.
They could have done that. In fact, Fnatic could have done Maokai for Huni, and that would have been an even better lockdown comp, in my opinion. But still, the Lulu's not a bad choice.
Lulu works with the composition, you know, on the hunt, speed up, get some shields out, buff up whoever gets caught. It's extra appeal for Victor. Victor has the issue that he's a very immobile mid laner. He somehow gets engaged upon. He deals a whole lot of damage, but if you want to keep him alive, yesterday we saw Fnatic pick up Victor and have the Janna with the Flash Monsoon to keep him alive. Now they have some peel from Alistar. They feel it's not enough, so they want to add a little bit of a Huni flavor to that with the Lu. Mm-hmm. But again, no hard, you know, lockdown from Fnatic just yet. You know, they have the Alistar paralyzed, but they usually don't need it.
Yeah, that's true. And also, you can see what they're going to try to do, possibly. Just get Rain over to run in there on Olaf and just Wild Growth in the moment, yeah, he starts taking damage.
But go ham.
It could work. We'll see if the Wolves, though, can maybe do something here. Do you guys think that's possible? Why don't you let us know with your predictions that LOL Esports is the place. CW win or FNC win are the tweets, the hashtags. That's what we want to hear. We'll read those out later on in the day. But for now, saw a lot of Fnatic shirts in the crowd. They're definitely making some noise now as they prepare to meet the Copenhagen Wolves. Their eighth game in the split here. We're starting out onto the Rift.
Now, I really want to figure out what both of these teams are going to do level one to get the lanes they want. Copenhagen Wolves on Vladimir in a solo lane. Ideally, have the jungler start on the weak side or on the bottom lane side. Get to level three to protect and shadow that young buck on Vladimir. Keep him alive. And Fnatic, they want a lane swap.
They may indeed get it, but for now, fanned out around the map. Copenhagen Wolves are going to be going pretty deep here to try to get some vision. They might want to be trying to scout this lane swap, and Axe goes into Unlimited's face. They won't stop Copenhagen Wolves from pushing five members into this jungle. That's going to prompt the typical response from Fnatic. Let's go down to the bottom side and do the same thing to you.
Now, how well have these teams studied each other? Are there patterns in their lane swap behavior? Can you trick them into doing what you want? Copenhagen Wolves, are they just going to take this preemptive swap, stay here? I'm going to go bottom. Is Fnatic going to say, okay, who's predicting who? I just want to see how it turns out. I'm done trying to predict this.
A lot of wards out for Fnatic through that bottom jungle, but they also managed to get one around the Gromp, between the Gromp and Blue, since Huni was able to move around and place that down before he backs. So they'll have a little bit more all-around vision.
The one thing, though, if Fnatic choose to stay bottom, they have the option to take a camp if they want, because Copenhagen Wolves are about to reveal themselves to a ward. So if the Copenhagen Wolves want to lane bot and get a camp, they will get spotted by a ward. This is Fnatic having good vision control right here. So now they can choose. Is it too late to swap? Yes, it is. We'll have to lane this.
Really like this. They knew exactly what was going on with Copenhagen Wolves. So with all of that...
Well, they didn't. They had a good way of finding out, but they still got the wrong lanes.
Well, they had to guess beforehand, right? Yeah. So then they consign themselves to it, but still...
They know
what they're up against before they go through. So let's see if that's going to be enough to get them through the landing phase. As the Gromp is started on Fnatic's side and the Krugs are started on Copenhagen Wolves' side, we take our places and have our normal lanes.
So Yellowstar started a heal on that Alistar, knowing he slows the Gromp down just a little bit, but he knows he's going to get pushed in anyways, so he doesn't need that combo on level 2. Look how they're not touching any creeps until the very last moment, because they know they're going to get pushed, so they want that to happen as quickly as they can. Freeze, extra shot on the minions, draw some aggro, this facilitates the push. This is two extra auto attacks that Freeze just wasted. Not in the sense that they didn't do any damage, but in the sense that they pushed quicker. Same here, Unlimited, you know, he's poking on the bot lane. Every time you auto-attack within minion range, you draw aggro. So that's what Yellowstar's trying to do. He's just like, hit me in the face. Make my minions attack you, your minions attack my minions. We don't lose any creeps, and then we can farm on their tower. And now we have to see how well can Yellowstar and Reckless see us on their tower. And how well can Youngbuck see us on their tower.
Question for both of them right now. So, Darkbinding goes a little bit wide. Rainover, though, is making his trip down bottom. Let's see if he stops for a side of crab first. Nope. Actually, yeah. Okay, let's take it. Let's take one. Let's take two. There we go. Get himself a little bit of early vision.
He has to be careful of the counter gank. So he can't set up for this gank here because he's smart enough to know that that one that will be warded, he knew where Aerox started as well. He started on the Gromp, so he knows exactly what pattern of jungle Aerox is in, and he might actually go find him.
Oh, he might. There's the ward down. Aerox is low. He's got to back away from this Raptor now. He's going towards him on the aggro, turns his attention to Rainover, should be able to pick that one up. But Aerox jumps in,
he gets it.
Secure it. There we go, the axe slows him down. Rainover's ghosting in, parallel convergence coming down, and he throws it in. One more, there's the shield. Aerox stays alive, but it was a close miss.
Expensive Raptor.
Yeah.
And now he can go back to bottom. He finds the jungle first. Instead of running the risk of getting counter gank, he takes out threat number one, which is the jungle, and he can now dive behind that bot lane. He also going for the minion attacks. He wants a Q flash.
Unlimited is there. He gets chunked out a little bit. There goes the Dark Binding, and Rainover takes a lot of damage in return. He'll have to back away, but that does buy Reckless and Yellowstar some time on the minions as Huni.
It gives them breathing lane. Exactly what they need. They got pushed to the tower. Look at the CS differential on the bottom lane. 10 CS down on Reckless, so this is why we wanted to see that lane swap come out. Because Youngbuck, he's even and still has his teleport against Huni. So he's going okay. If he would have gotten lane swapped upon, he would have been really far behind, and we would see the reiteration of yesterday, because Vladimir doesn't have that utility that Lulu brings to the table. Lulu from behind with Wild Dwarf is still fine.
So Fnatic's okay with this, but again, it's not the ideal start for them. So they really weren't able to make as much done since it took a while for the Wolves to really reveal themselves. Reckless spell shields, the Dark Binding from Unlimited. But now he's starting to catch up. He's still 10 CS down, though, as you mentioned. We'll take a look at this mid lane. Sorin and Febiven, it's been pretty much dead on even. So you said earlier, Febiven is on a very immobile
the signature gank from
there we go.
Echo. I've seen this before. Foul conversion. Chase dive one.
The Febiven, he's going to have to flash it.
He respects it. Yesterday, we saw people hesitate, see the parallel conversions come out, and then die to that gank. Almost seems better for mid laners to ward your own Raptor camp against an Echo these days. Because this is the third time in three jungle Echo games that we've seen this. I think we've seen Svenskeren do it as well. Mm-hmm. Hide in the Raptors, parallel conversions, wait 2 seconds, phase dive dash over the wall, and then try and land that all attack, extended all attack gap closer on the mid laner. Very good against immobile mid laners.
He's getting a lot of practice on this jungle Echo as well. Now he's found Huni.
He's ran over
with the convergence. Rainover's there for the defense, but still nothing doing for Fnatic. They're not really able to find an answer to him just yet. He's a little low on mana, so Airwax won't be able to make any more shenanigans happen for just a minute, but still, he's perfectly fine. Take stock of the two junglers, though, too. What are they both doing right now? They're both trying to get respective lanes ahead, and it seems to be working fairly well for both of them.
They're just the insurance policy for every one of their laners right now. And Copenhagen Wolves, they can be very happy with this start. Look at Youngbuck. Yesterday, he was down in the biggest CS at 10 differential that we've seen so far in the split. Now he's actually just 4 CS down against Huni. Mm-hmm. Against Huni, you might as well call that a lead.
We still got 4 more minutes to go before we figure that one out, but I don't see that changing anytime soon, you're right. So meanwhile, Friezen and Unlimited are still keeping that lead over Reckless and Yellowstar. That CS differential to 11. It hasn't grown by much, but look at this. Rainover's coming down again. Is he going to get spotted? There is a ward in that brush.
It's so hard to gank this lane, because Yellowstar has to... he has to telegraph the move. That's what it means, you know, that distance is too big.
Go to the mean text for it, though.
Freeze?
He is very low. Do they have enough to take him down, forcing the summoner heal? Reckless checks very deep into this one. They don't quite have it. That will mean that they're just going to have to settle for getting a little bit more pressure.
Yeah, if you're outside of combo range, usually, yes, you can do minion taxi, which is W to the minion, and then Q flash forward to close the gap, but you always have that black shield. And the second Yellowstar dashes to the minion, Unlimited knows what's coming. He doesn't have to react to it. He can just predict it. Like, why would Yellowstar dash to the minion? Of course he's going to Q flash. Black shield preemptively. He dodged the Olaf. Good reaction from Copenhagen Wolves. However, this losing matchup is only down still to 10 CS that it was earlier.
And you kind of expect this if you have to take the 2v2.
Mostly due to the pressure from Rainover, though. Usually, Rainover uses his pressure to get Fnatic ahead.
Freeze is really low hanging around here, though. This is dangerous.
And now he used the pressure to stop them from getting behind. But Freeze, he did drop low, but Unlimited, he can just put the pool in the brush right here. I imagine that's what he's going to do. See if his gold ticks. Or the binding just disappears, means you hit an angry cow.
All the more angrier. So for the time being, Reckless will have a little bit more breathing room. While the first back happens for Freeze, he picks up his BF sword. Easy peasy.
He's fine backing on that amount of money. So even though he got chunked out, he has the ideal base timing for a Caitlyn. So
he had a bit left over too.
Enough talk about the bot lane.
Let's move it around, though, because Huni's been pretty much back and forth a little bit with Youngbuck. There's been some help from Airwax in that department as he's hanging around to the top, helping Sorin get his blue. And Sorin has actually kept pretty even pace with Febiven here. I want to see what happens between in this Victor and, of course, Jace matchup. It's a lore battle, really.
Mm-hmm. Not too much informed about the lore. What I do know is that usually when you look at scaling compositions, like the one from Wolf, you would say even is ahead. Because if you stay even in the early to mid game, that means you'll eventually get ahead in the late game. But also, usually when you look at Sivir compositions, even is also ahead because you just want to wait to level 6, group on an objective, try and take that down. I want to see Fnatic secure a tower or a dragon soon before Copenhagen Wolves scale too much.
Yeah, so for the Wolves, yes, they kept the Sivir down. That doesn't really mean as much as you just said. If they go ahead and get an early dragon, that'll get them on. That'll get them rolling, but I feel like Fnatic is a team that's not going to easily give this up. The Crab is already taken down. They'll have that vision available if there is a movement by the Wolves, but they seem more content in just letting lane phase play out for the time being.
No, in terms of dragon pressure, right now it's the Wolves that have to stop Fnatic from getting it. The Wolves are still scaling right now. They still want to get into late game with that Polk on Jace, with that Vladimir. They just want to prevent Fnatic from getting that early dragon. If they can stall it into like 12, 13 minutes, that slows down the third potential dragon into a very comfortable timing. And yet again, we see that range advantage right here. Reckless has to farm into two champions with bigger range than him. And they have the Black Shield to counteract the very obvious combo that Yellowstar will have to do. Heal for a lot there, so I imagine, yeah, just take a look here. Here, Yellowstar has 3 points into that heal, so less teamfight value. You know, no up value in Pulverize, no more, like, less cooldown on Headbutt, so everything into the heal just to survive that lane.
Meanwhile, Sorin has actually developed himself a little bit of a lead here. Let's take a look at those Dragon Timers. It takes a very long time for the Wolves to usually get this one. They're not too worried. It's their average. But Sorin, he's going in. Chaos Storm down. He has to flash away from this. Rainover gets on the run. The teleport comes in from Huni. The axes are flying. They've targeted out Airwax. Let's see if they can take him down. Another teleport flashing on in. Looking for Sorin. Wild Growth on the Olaf. And he should be able to secure first blood. There it goes. Still running through. Febivin providing extra fire. A double kill for Rainover. The Olaf is going wild. Ragnar rock and roll, and Unlimited goes down as the rest of Fnatic collapse around. Rainover finally falls.
And this is why Huni is the carry of Fnatic. A fight breaks loose, initiated by the Copenhagen Wolves in the mid lane.
Goodbye.
And Huni arrives with his teleport before Youngbuck even starts channeling his. He gets in there. He gets a two-man Wild Growth. He takes down somebody else, and he carried that fight so hard for Fnatic, because this is Copenhagen Wolves initiating this play. And Huni reacts quicker than the Copenhagen Wolves' top laner. And you give Fnatic an inch, they'll take a mile. Watch that again. So look, this is not Fnatic starting this play. You go on even. Look at the teleport right now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. He lands. And then go back. Now Youngbuck starts coming in. Look at the Wild Growth. Two-man knockup on Olaf. Exactly what we said was going to happen. Youngbuck hits one guy with ultimate. Bot lane coming in as well. Freezes late to the party. Unlimited flashes in, but there's nothing he can do. And then they somehow keep Rainover alive long enough for them to just convincingly win that fight. Huni gets protected by his teammates. Everybody wants to take the bullet. Eventually, Youngbuck drops. And that's... We went from such a stale early game to explosion.
That's a Fnatic game in a nutshell. They buy their time, they wait for a minute, they react quicker, especially Huni on that teleport. And now this dragon, it should be free. They're taking their time about it. Unlimited is going to send a binding that way, but it'll just help Fnatic secure this one up. First dragon, first blood, 4 kills to 1. They've got themselves 2,000 gold ahead, Crepo, and this is just looking like a Fnatic game by the numbers to start.
And I wonder, how does this make the Copenhagen Wolves feel? They must regret going for that play, and somewhere along the lines it went wrong. They could have had so much, ended up with so little. They had that advantage. But Reckless is good at playing these losing matchups and just going even. Mm-hmm. Because he knows his team has his back, and he knows eventually Rainover will show up and shadow that lane. And now they're looking for a dive on the bot lane, it seems. Your camera.
There we go. Unlimited, very low. Rainover running on through. You can't stop him when he's Ragnarokin. And Freeze trying to jump back. Heals to stay alive longer. Rainover will take the last tower shot, but he doesn't go down. Again, Fnatic with a successful dive. 2 pickups. He can take a tower from here.
We went from bang on even to 3,000 gold lead at 13 minutes. Roughly a 3-minute span. Fnatic, their foot on the pedal.
They saw what H2K did in their game, and they said, you know what? We could do that too. Yeah, right now, they're on pace to do it, but still, Fnatic, just master strokes, playing this one out so well in the beginning.
Yeah, completely mirrored, right? You're losing bot lane ever so slightly. Oh, just bring more folks to the party. Dive them. You have Alistar. Press W, press R. Watch that tower hit you 6 times in a row without taking any damage.
Yep. And Huni now strong enough to deal with Youngbuck solo.
Okay,
maybe not. Oh, Wild Growth force to Sorin and jumps on in. Whimsy to get away. Hemo Plague doesn't do enough damage, but Sorin closing the gap. He's under tower range, slowed by the Glitter Lance. Does he have a shot? No!
He misses!
Huni!
Manages to escape right there. The crowd. They're loving it.
Youngbuck's in trouble. He has to go under the tower. Yellowstar stopped by the binding, but man, those fancy feet to dodge out Sorin's Shock Blast. What a play.
Oh, what a play. He did everything right to get out of there. Still a little bit of help on Copenhagen Wolves' side to allow him to escape, but somehow it happens every game, right? We say, who needs a top lane carry? We say, Lulu. Nah, you can't carry on that. That's utility. He's not going to play that. Teleports in the mid lane. Full 6 seconds ahead of Youngbuck. Perfect Wild Growth, and now suddenly he finds himself 0-0-4.
They threw 3 bans at this guy.
first picked away his next favorite champion. And he still does this.
He still has more champions.
You stop this guy?
No, you don't. I think people should really stop banning Huni and start looking at hitting other champion pools. Fnatic is so used to having everything open for them. Like this Olaf, like this Alistar. They're now invading
this blue buff. And they take what they want. It's not your blue buff, that's our blue buff. So, we're just about shy of 15 minutes into the game. Fnatic's got this gold lead of 4,000.
Hang on.
They're gonna grab another tower. Okay, 4,000 and some change. About 5 now.
Give or take.
Yeah, you know, it's just counting it up. They're trying to match what H2K was able to do earlier. Youngbuck's gonna find something in this rush. But they own this map. Look at the wards. They've got them all over the jungle of Copenhagen Wolves.
Yeah, I love the triple pink ward lineup. Huni.
Oh god.
Dueling, throwing that pixie in Youngbuck's face.
Help picks!
One.
He's
two.
Going to dive the flash. Oh! Huni! Can he get out of this?
Nope.
Yeah, yes! Wild growth! Hello!
Calculated.
Calculated aggression.
Huni Potter. The boy who lived. Look at those glasses.
Really
yeah,
is.
Look at those pink wards that Fnatic has placed in the river right now. They're line number one, and then they back them up and they give offensive vision to defend those pink forts and just completely control the river. You know, 1, 2, 3 on the left side, one more deep in the red jungle too. One tower going down here. Copenhagen Wolves, they're back against the wall. Airwax going
try.
In.
Febivin targeted by Airwax, who has to turn his attention over to Rainover, who's Ragnarokking, and the hemo play comes out as Youngbuck joins the fray, but Yellowstar stops him up for just a minute. He's looking
Reckless.
For Febivin. He's going to go down without getting the kill. The Chaos Storm comes out. Now Sorin, Airwax, Unlimited Freeze, all on the run. The ace in the hole. Looks like it was spent. I was wrong about that one, but Airwax going low. They get one for none. They keep on pushing another tower. That gold lead just keeps on growing.
Now when somebody gets caught, Fnatic presses the panic button and everybody rushes to help their fellow teammates. Yellowstar comes in, fantastic peel, forces Youngbuck to flash aggressively, and he just wants to finish them off. Gets Victor in the face.
You gave credit to Yellowstar in the beginning for having this game plan, having the calm, decisive shot calling.
No, immaculate game plan.
Immaculate, let's go with that. But Fnatic, as a team, react to it just so quickly. They don't question a thing.
Yeah, look where Huni is right now. I mean, somehow, I think he managed to find his way into this fight. Youngbuck teleports in for the flank. Febivin, he has such good awareness because he gets flying from the top, yet he flashes to the top himself, you know? It's a little contradictory. Huni is now teleporting in. They force Youngbuck into the choke, and Yellowstar, he has the front. And such good awareness from Fnatic members. Usually when you get flanked from one side, your immediate reaction is to flash to another. You know, get as far away from the threat as you can. Febivin, he's watching his minimap. He says, okay, there's only one threat here, four below me. Let's just flash up into my teammates, let them help me.
Yeah.
Kill Youngbuck to boot.
And Febivin,
even more gold.
For as much as he's been targeted this game, they haven't been able to take him down. He's gotten exactly where he needs to on this victory. It's 17 and a half minutes. He's on an item and a half. He's starting to get into a scary picture.
Honestly,
and Copenhagen Wolves can't handle.
You're right when you say that. I often forget about Febivin and I'm watching these games because I'm always looking, you know, as a bot lane main myself, watching the bot lane, and you can't not look at Huni, the magnificent beast that he is. Febivin is just so consistent in what he brings to the Fnatic lineup. Very rarely will you see him drop the ball to the point where it costs Fnatic, if at all. And fantastic MSI performance as well. He's really grown as a player.
Absolutely. And all of Fnatic, the evolution of this team has just been, well, it's been glorious so far. Dragon up and available. Rainover and Yellowstar, with the help of Reckless and Febivin, should polish it off nice and quick. Copenhagen Wolves just don't seem to have a reaction. Even if they move out, they're going to be spotted by wards all over the map.
Yeah, and just to further exemplify what Fnatic wants to do with their lineup, they send in Rainover. That's the thing, right? And it looks silly on paper, but then eventually they want to buff him up with Wild Growth, use the proxy slows from Huni, and to facilitate Rainover getting in there, well, the Grom battle ensues. They build two movement speed items. In addition to On the Hunt, they have Righteous Glory, Talisman of Ascension. If Fnatic want to fight, they will get it. There is no way the Wolves can outrun them unless they have 5 acceleration gates from Jace, and even then, so much move speed on the lineup, which makes up for the lack of hard CC other than the Pulverize, and then eventually the Wild Growth come on.
Yeah, and they've got that. We've already seen it once happen with Rainover just runs headlong into the team, and the moment they start chasing him down, or rather jumping on him, Huni just pops the Wild Growth. Yellowstar gonna take a Shock Blast, but he's a big cow. He'll get over it. Copenhagen Wolves don't really have any control over these lanes. They're gonna try to get a bit back in the top. Youngbuck's pushing against the Tier 1 tower. Finally, he'll get a little help from Unlimited, but he's got to back away. This isn't safe against Fnatic.
Yeah, they don't have control because they didn't play to their strengths. They didn't have to brawl or fight. You had to scale, group up, and poke. With their composition, what they want to do is avoid fights. They want to put Fnatic in a position where they are poked so hard get out vision controlled, and lose their objectives without taking any like kills or deaths in the process. That's what the Wolves wanted to do with their first four picks. Then they added the Vladimir, which gave it a bit of a teamfight component later on, but I feel it could have been a different pick. It went even in the lane, but didn't really mesh well with the Wolves' lineup. They don't have this dive that you comp, right? Caitlyn wants to siege and poke, put the traps. Morgana wants to defensively use the binds. Echo wants to lure people in and then re-engage eventually, or have the disengage zone with the W, but Jayce and Caitlyn are the main parts of this composition. They wanted to poke, but we've never seen Copenhagen Wolves poke.
They haven't been able to do it. The lane phase was all they really thought about, and it seemed the Fnatic fully punished them. Baron has now hit the field. We're 20 minutes in. We know Fnatic, they're one of those teams that will just go for it when they're up enough. We usually don't get it till about 27 and a half in, a little longer, Copenhagen Wolves, but that team is not in a position to try and even stop a Baron at this point.
Fnatic is just going to pressure the Wolves until they're absolutely sure that all the wards are gone. Keep this pressure up for a while. Reckless aggressively taking that binding.
Chunk out of Unlimited. Rainover goes around the side. Airwax looks to catch him, but he doesn't give as good as he gets. Fnatic still trying to polish off this tower.
Oh, and they can rotate to mid.
Minions in the mid. Yeah, they can just move that way. Airwax goes in. Goes at the Timewinder, slows down Yellowstar, but Copenhagen Wolves are grouped up here. They can't get much done. Meanwhile, the tower's going down.
And exactly what they need to do. They put two members in between, saying either you stop us here and you come poke us and you give up the power, or we just facilitate the rotation to the mid lane if you're inhibitor. Copenhagen Wolves have a couple of wards spread out. 2 minutes left on most of them, but darkness in the Baron pit.
Fnatic looks to maybe take their time about this one, trying to bait it out while Huni goes down and clears out bot wave. He's got teleport up. He'll be able to get into the fight if needed. Copenhagen Wolves could be walking into a trap.
And they're fine waiting Huni's TP out. Most teams, or some teams, will go for a five-man bait here. Fnatic know that four is enough with the teleport from Huni in the flank or in the back, and they don't want to lose that massive wave on the bot lane. Right now, they're fine doing nothing with some of their members, but they always respect the minion waves. They don't allow themselves to get rotated on in the mid lane if this bait fails. They say, okay, they're not biting immediately. Well, let's push out our lanes first and try again. Some teams you see trying to bait too long and then get rotated upon in the mid lane like they could have done here, you know. They haven't dropped a single tier 1 tower in the mid or bot lane, even though that's where the most turret pressuring champions are, Jayce and Caitlyn.
And honestly, that top tower was really only taken because of the insane amount of pressure they tried to put on Huni, which, by the way, didn't net a kill.
Yeah, Campaloo, which will still buff her teammates.
22 minutes on the clock. Fnatic are now about 9,000 gold ahead of the Copenhagen Wolves.
Massive.
It's huge. We thought that lead against H2K was big. I mean, Fnatic, once again, they just are able to do it the same as well. They continue to apply pressure all over the map. Copenhagen Wolves do grab a bit of vision around Baron, but they'll be able to sense if Fnatic do try to rush it. But Fnatic don't need to. They have no need to make any rash decisions because they have complete control of this game and they're not letting go.
Yeah, watch Huni. Pushes down mid lane, pops Whimsy, moves down to the bot lane. Melee wants to push that again. Feberman takes over the mid lane then in regard. Reckless is still solo pushing top lane. Has the backup vision around the Wolves to safely do that up until the point where the tier tower used to be. So he has offensive pressure all the way into the enemy side of the map. Feberman is respecting the zone control. He's not going any farther. He doesn't have the vision to do so. Huni knows he's unlikely to get camped by more people right there in the bottom lane, so he can overextend because if more, it takes about two people at least to kill Huni. That's enough for Fnatic to start the Baron. So,
and it's worth.
It looks so easy for them. Everything is done with great calculation and with great foresight.
That foresight may well net them this game. They do win this one in a row, 8-0.
Well on their way to the biggest win streak.
Yeah, that record 9, that Fnatic of 2013, the Spring holds that one.
Here we go.
Might want to replicate that as we start to see them chasing down Freeze. He's knocked over and taken down. Huni on the chase looks for Soren. Airwax comes around the side. Wild growth on Huni to get a little CC action in there. And Fnatic are running wild all over these Wolves. Airwax, all they can do to try and get away. Meanwhile, Soren, Rainover, chunks him down, throws the axe into his back. And now Youngbuck has to pull away. They've lost two members. They've lost some flashes. They've lost it all, and Fnatic are paying for this Baron.
Zero hesitation on the hunt. Righteous Glory, Talisman of Ascension, all used to close that gap. Flying from Huni, he herds the sheep, sends some of them left, sends some of them right. Throws himself in as a one-man bomb.
Airwax
flashes aggressively and uses Wild Growth. And yeah, Yellowstar wants to
stop that from
play ping-pong with Airwax. That's all he has to do right now, knock him out.
Well, they've got enough damage without him. They don't need the cow for sure. He'll just hang around the side. Airwax is looking to make a massive gap close. If this would be a Baron Seal, it'll be a
they don't know where he
move.
Is. Now they do.
Know where he is. Parallel Convergence comes down. The Polymorph comes in.
Ooh, he misses.
Oh, Youngblood's there. Airwax is in the pit. This could happen. Reckless, or rather, Rainover shut down, but he has to jump over. Airwax looks to take down Huni. The Baron might have been a mistake as they took a little bit too much time. That's a double kill going over to Airwax. Febivin, meanwhile, is still able to clean up two of his own. But that could have been a lot worse. Airwax jumps in and Reckless outplays the Hecko.
If you're wondering what's happened or what happened there. All right, Yellowstar was looking for the WQ combo. He thought he was in range. So he popped his Q, but he did it too early. So he basically hit the floor. Then, let's watch this again. I'll explain it once you actually see it. So Hex comes down. This is good. He messes up his combo to the point where he presses Q. And he's like, oh, crap. You know, I have to W him out of there. But then Airwax does a smart thing. He dashes in aggressively, and this forces the W from Yellowstar to alter the direction, and he knocks him in the pit by accident. It cleans up some kills, and then, of course, Echo can rewind time and get out of there. So unfortunate interaction, but still Fnatic. Big lead here. This could have been a throw. The game was even, but... Props to Airwax, though. Single-handedly stopping a Baron, getting two kills. Forcing a Summoner heal on Reckless. Good play.
Yeah. Did what they could in the moment. Nonetheless, they still find themselves down 10,000 gold. Fnatic eyeballing the dragon, but the Baron is more important.
Evan's like, guys, can I solo this?
Like, no,
just go mid lane.
Need you this time.
Clear waves. Don't do it. Don't get greedy.
So rare mistake from Fnatic, but now they go ahead and start to force this Baron once again. Do they have the damage altogether? There is an Airwax around the side. Baron's taking a little time.
They don't want to finish this. They just want to draw into wolves. They're gonna pop on the hunt, and they're gonna go.
Airwax is around the back. There's on the hunt. There they turn their attention. Unlimited is gonna be the one. Youngbuck as well soon to follow. He's able to execute his ultimate, but that is at a grievous cost. As now Soren being chased down, Huni will pick him up. Who says Lulu can't carry? 2-3-0 in favor of Fnatic, and it's right back to Baron.
And now they want to find Airwax. They know he's long in the back line. They know he wants to steal it. So he's like, okay, we'll bring it down to 5,000 gold. Come closer, Wolves. Come stop us. Stop all those moving speed steroids, and you can't outrun that. Now Airwax, he's not trying to flank, but they know where he is. I doubt Fnatic will make the same mistake.
There we go. Airwax can't get involved. The Chaos Storm's down. Airwax is just burning away. He's going to jump back, rewind time. Can't make that outplay, though. Febivin knocks him down. And this Baron will be an easy cleanup for Fnatic. Oh, they are just doing so many things right here, Crepo.
Yep. Everything going right. One tiny mistake from Yellowstar, but in the gist of things, triple speed up steroid. Look at how quick they're going. They're rolling over. Soren. You can't stop that OF. Nobody can stop him. You have to kill him, but he's too tanky, too much base damage.
It doesn't matter if he's melee range. He's just too fast.
He's just too fast. Coming out of this play, Yellowstar 0-0 in 10 here. Supporting his way to the Fnatic squad. Fantastic shot calling too, because you don't see that. You don't know who's making these
calls. Oh, good lord. That is not your Baron, or that is not your dragon, Copenhagen Wolves. That is Fnatic's dragon.
Yeah. We'll take this, we'll take that, we'll take your jungle, we'll take your tower. We'll take this victory, is what Fnatic is saying.
Well on their way to it, 18 kills to 3. The gold lead just keeps spiraling out of the Copenhagen Wolves' control. Another tower should be Fnatic's. In just a moment with this, they'll have knocked down the entire inner ring without losing two of their outers.
It's so weird to see so many Caitlyn's come back because she got buffed, but it was a very minor buff. If you look at how what changed. Let's touch on that a little later as we see Fnatic.
They knocked these down too fast. Inhibitors now being fired on. 28 minutes in, Fnatic looking to close this one out nice and early. It's the hole blocked by Reckless. So with that, Fnatic back off with the Baron buff still in tow. Copenhagen Wolves, they've got to move fast, but this game is very much out of their hands.
Yeah, Headshot got buffed a little bit on that Caitlyn. Every 8th or later on 7th, later on 6th auto attack, you get a Headshot. And it deals a little more damage against targets with a lot of armor, but that really doesn't help Caitlyn all that much, in my opinion.
Not in this situation.
I mean, yes, you do a little more damage with tanks, but that means you need to hit tanks multiple times to do that, and you can't afford that against this Fnatic lineup. You don't have time.
There goes the Convergence. Airwax, he jumps on in. He rewinds time. but he is nearly blown up. Reckless, Hema Plague on him, and now Youngbuck could look to try and pick him up, but the rest of Fnatic are here. Reckless goes on in, Wild Growth is on him, doesn't have the damage, can't quite get the crit, but they've still got the tower taken down. Fnatic give up no one. They'll be able to secure another inhib and keep on going if they want, but they'll smartly back away once
again.
And
the Copenhagen Wolves wish they could rewind time, not 4 seconds, but about 20 minutes to back before they went for that aggressive play in the mid lane, where Huni teleported in, picked himself up 3 or 4 assists, and...
Well, at least Aerox is like a
the joys of...
Like Anton.
TLDR, the Wolves done goofed in the early game, and Fnatic, give him an inch and they will snowball the game, make it an avalanche, and take yet another win. 8 in a row.
All those wards Fnatic has in the Copenhagen Wolves base. You've got Youngbuck down on the bottom side trying to push back the dead inhibitor wave. There's Huni going to be pushing in the mid. Airwalk sent to deal with him now.
All right, they're flanking on Freeze.
Freeze Unlimited finds Yellow
Star. 2 seconds.
He's gone. Fnatic with the godlike kill. 7-0-5. Huni now looking to make a play onto Airwalk, who's forced to flash away just to try and stay alive here. Rainover and Huni with the Wild Growth on the chase. The help picks and the glitter lands. Huni picks him up, and now this looks like the end game for Fnatic. We don't need inhibitor turrets. Okay, I guess maybe we do.
Deny.
Let the minions do
the
it.
The showing of his mathematic capabilities. Count to 5 and then pulverize as the black shield goes down, but Femme says nope. From 100 to 0 in 1 second.
Might be just again. Reckless chases free. Here we go. Way back. There's the Chaos Storm. It's going to follow Youngbuck onto the fountain, and it's going to take him down. It's Reckless who gets the Boomerang Blade to finish the job. Meanwhile, Nexus turret fired down. Febivin manages to barely stay alive before being taken out by Freeze, but that is not even going to matter. 30 minutes into the game, and Fnatic take themselves an 8-0 start.
Clean. Very, very clean, just as we expected from Fnatic, and this just puts even more emphasis on the matchup next week.
It's going to be
game
big.
On a week.
Both these teams, H2K and Fnatic, have just taken surgical victories.
Surgical victories in very similar styles. The way League of Legends should be played, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. Although Fnatic, they were kind of pinned down early. I feel if they got into the same situation against a better team, with a similar draft, I feel there was a potential opening. It's really, really hard to say that, you know, and that's nitpicking.
You got to at this point. When the team is this good, you have to find what little there is to criticize. And one of them, a couple mistakes, and that early game.
I want to see teams challenge Fnatic with a clear-cut plan, like the Copenhagen Wolves almost had with his double poke composition. Find the right lanes. They had that lead in the bot lane. They had a scaling Jace in mid lane. They neutralized Huni in top lane, but Huni, when you neutralize him in lane, if you can, he will just teleport down and help his teammates get the advantage. Exactly what he did. I can't stress enough that one play around the 10-minute mark. Instant teleport. Fevens gets ganks, instant teleport. Kim's in. That just shows how well oiled the machine Fnatic is.
But for these Wolves, I mean, I don't know.
Two teams are locked in fifth place. We're going to start with Gambit Gaming. It is going to be Cabochard, Diamond Prox, Betsy, Forgiven, Gosu Pepper, and Sean's their coach. This is a team that's sort of swapped place in the standings with UOL. They're on that 3-game winning streak. And Unicorns of Love, they're the ones that are on a 3-game losing streak. Let's quickly look at their roster deficio. Unicorns of Love, of course, with Chachi in the top lane, Kickus in the jungle, Power of Evil mid, Vardex, Hillisang, and Sheepy to round out the team. And as we said, opposite games yesterday, swapping places in the standings, it's all up and down.
Yeah, it really seems like Gambit has just found a way that works for them as a team. Again, it's going back to the spring split style. Cabochard is once again the main carry. It's not about Forgiven in the mid lane. Betsy also getting more focus, obviously, but get Cabochard fed in the early game. We saw his fantastic fizz. We have seen his Hecarim and so on. Like last game, 8 kills. He died once. Insane kill participation. He was just everywhere on the map. And we don't get to see the same for Unicorns of Love, and they are what we call star play in Power of Evil. It doesn't seem to have the same punch, honestly. And Power of Evil often ends up getting himself killed by playing too aggressive.
Yeah, not only that, the champions that he's playing are not working in his favor. So many of them, little to no lane presence, all of the scaling, things that are not working out in Unicorn's favor. We're about to jump into picks and bans. I just want to highlight a few of the interesting stats and trends that we've noticed over the course of the day. Gragas has now gone unpicked twice. Ryze twice as well, 26 out of 28 games for that Ryze. And teams are starting to lose a little bit of priority on those picks that we had considered coming in.
Right.
Still incredibly strong.
I think teams are figuring out there's quite a lot of counterplays to someone like Ryze, so you don't have to ban it. You can play around it. Gragas, it's also because Echo has become a big thing for a lot of junglers here, so they might try and take it over the Gragas. I still think, though, Rek'Sai Gragas are the two main picks, though. Pick and bans. Morgana against Hillersang, I feel like I've seen it before. And I think it's going to happen almost every single game the Unicorns will play this split.
Yeah, Morgana is actually one of the hidden gems here in Europe. Not one of the most picked or played, but 11 wins, 2 losses. That is a fantastic win-loss ratio. And I do want to quickly just circle back to the Gragas, because Cabochard is still playing at top lane for Gamma.
True.
If it gets locked in early, don't know which lane it's going into. Maokai was taken away from Chachi. Let's see how UOL reply.
And the thing about this Gragas top lane here, it's a strategy for Gambit to have flex picks overall here. We've seen Fizz, Gragas. I mean, there's been multiple picks. Lulu has gone support. It's gone mid lane. It can even go top lane for them. And it's something they have done now over the last few months. Honestly, they did it also in Spring Split. Let's see if it's going to be a factor. They tend to leave a lot of OP picks up here and try and more target ban. Morgana here against Hillersang, Cassiopeia against Powerweaver, not considered an OP pick at all. So once again, the likes of Kalista is open, and that's not a forgiven champion.
Well, we'll find out if it is. Something that has been a forgiven champion was that Corki. 3 games in a row, 3 games undefeated. Forgiven's doing a lot of work expanding that champion pool. It was also a very high priority on red side for Gambit yesterday. With Fizz banned away, their first lock-in will be the Rek'Sai.
Hey, you talked about the Gragas, how some teams have favored Echo over it. If you do ban one of the tier 1 junglers and the other one is left open, you should always expect it to be first pick. That does mean, of course, the Unicorns have plenty of picks to go for. Alistar for Hillersang, he had a decent game. Yesterday he roamed around pretty well and Morgana has been banned away. But then he loses some of that pick pressure we normally see when he plays these skill shot champions that can really set them up like Thresh, which could also be a go-to pick for him.
Let's take a look at what else is available. Alistar, as you mentioned, Kalista-Alistar was the combo that Unicorns locked in yesterday. Looks like they might be changing that recipe up. Fnatic did the Sivir, HTK did the Sivir, Unicorns doing the same.
I think this, in terms of overall team synergy, is the best 2v2 lane you can have. It's hard to remove Kalista there, because Kalista you can add her in as well and you have an insane carry. But what Sivir offers and what Alistar offers to a team in terms of team fighting and also overall map pressure, you have a fantastic roaming support and you have an AD carry that can control waves, push it into the tower when you start setting up these roams, then you teleport down, you have your jungler move in and you just dive because you got that Alistar ulti and you can punish people so hard if they don't have proper wave clear. Corki would be my expected AD carry for Forgiven. The Bard Corki lane is pretty good at pushing out as well, and that should be able to stop an Alistar at least from getting into the situation where he can dive them.
And of course, that was the combination that Gambit did run yesterday. It looks like it'll be locked in today, despite 5.11 having those small nerfs to Sivir's ultimate.
Okay.
Not making big changes, and actually, we're going to see the Lucian locked in here for Forgiven.
So let's just very quickly talk about why he's switching over. I think Forgiven would normally prefer then to get the Corki, but the reason he goes for Lucian here is because once you get a BF sword, you can start really out-trading this Sivir in the lane here. You can play very aggressive against her. Even from the start, it can be fairly even, but then get that BF sword, you take over completely. So Forgiven here, he's looking for blood.
And he's challenging the numbers, DeFicio. Forgiven, or rather, Lucian has been played 9 times in the summer split. All 9 games have been defeats. 0-9 in the current meta. We'll see if Forgiven can make it work and keep Gambit's winning streak alive. For Unicorns of Love, they're going to be looking for their mid laner, top laner, and jungler to round out their composition. And as per usual, should leave that mid lane pick to last.
Yeah.
And we'll find out what they're going to decide to lock in. Chachi will be getting the Ninja once more in Shen.
He had a very good performance yesterday against SK Gaming on Shen. The flash taunts he managed to pull off time and time again was beautiful, and I understand why he's going back to it. We've seen it being fairly strong throughout the day here on 5-11 as well. Not going for Lee Sin for Kick is, but Nidalee also a pick we've seen quite a few times. It's once again for me when you have this Sivir with how easy you can start setting up potential poke situations. Nidalee then starts shining a bit more, and you can also challenge the Rek'Sai in the early game.
So where does Cabochard go with this? We've seen Gnar into Shen twice, actually. Yesterday, Chachi's Shen got bullied around by Freddy's Gnar. Made his life a little difficult, and we'll see whether or not Cabochon wants to go that route. Alternatively, Lulu is locked in. That's going to be for Betsy in the mid lane. Maybe a harder carry here for Gambit. So Gambit looking to put together a very aggressive team composition as the pony has been secured.
Yeah, this is super, super standard for Gambit in what they like to do. They put Betsy on the more supportive mid laners. We have then a third carry in the top lane for Cabochon, as we always talk about how get him fed early on with your Rek'Sai. This 2v2 they're going to have with Rek'Sai Hecarim and the Ignite as a summoner spell is going to be insanely strong for them up in that top lane. And Shen won't be able to deal with that in terms of fighting. So Gambit once again, three carries. In a sense, even I'm going to even add in Lulu, even though we know it's more utility-based. I want to see though what Forgiven can do on Lucian, because he didn't go for the Corki. He was expecting Unicorn to have more hard engage, so you wouldn't get to set up your poke, and also the Corki into Sivir is a bit of a tricky lane due to the spell shield. Can he do well in the laning phase now on this Lucian? Can he become a carry? Because you always have to worry about that 500 range and all the zone control of an Alistar, of an Orianna ball, and the Shin Taunt, even the Taunt Flash that can come in from Visichachi. So it can be tough for Forgiven to deal damage, but that's why you have the likes of Hecarim in the top lane as well.
If there was anybody that was going to be able to position correctly around that or react to those flash taunts, it's going to be Forgiven. Something that Crepo likes to talk about a lot, the aggressive positioning and aggressive dashes that we see out of Forgiven. So we'll see how it works out. We did see that Orianna locked in for Power of Evil. I'm still not 100% on board with these scaling champions. When you have a player like Power of Evil who has the ability to be so impactful, I just feel like you're banking on the late game too much. But we'll see. I mean, Unicorns, they had moments that were good yesterday against SK.
Yeah.
However, they had decisions that were bad.
Yeah.
And that ended up costing them the game.
A lot of them involved Power of Evil. On an Orianna, he was like flashing in, trying to get kills, ends up dying for it in the laning phase, in team fights. Big, big problem for him.
So we'll find out if he's been able to rectify those problems. Hashtag GMBWin or hashtag UOLWin on Twitter at LOL Esports. We will take a look at your votes in-game and see who you think will turn their fortunes around. Gambit's flag lit up as we load up onto the Rift. And as we've said, Gambit started the split looking shaky, now strong. Unicorns, the exact opposite.
And let's talk a little bit about what Gambit has done so well lately here and the way they like to play and like to build the compositions. A lot of it involves around the new coach, Shaunz, who has a lot of focus on vision control and these rotations here, the macro play. And when you have a very mobile comp like a Hecarim, Rek'Sai, of course, with the tunnel, the global ulti, the Lulu with Whimsy, and a Bard as well to roam around, if you have proper vision, you can really create a lot of picks very easily and use that to snowball your lead. Let's see what's going to happen here. Forgiven, he's a smart man. He's just warded that bush here. Not going to risk a taunt from a Shen over. Even notice how Visichachi went down south of the wall. So in case someone had been standing there, you had to run into your own jungle to try and escape him. Otherwise, he would have taunted you.
So Unicorn still remain grouped up. Gambit are going to respond. It's a battle of pings and wards, as it were. Cabochon's grabbed himself that flask, so we'll see if he decides to go for a camp in an early back or how he decides to spend his time. And Hillisang starting Ancient Coin on that Alistar.
Minions have spawned.
Maybe looking for a swap, or maybe just like defensively against that range support of Bard, who really can punish melees.
Definitely the last one, and he wants to get an early talisman for himself. Unicorns of Love here, their composition is built around the fact that they can start 5-on-5 team fights. Sivir ulti, talisman from an Alistar, then the Shen ulti coming in when someone like Kikis or someone like Hillisang is trying to dive in on Gambit is how they want to play it. But it requires them to have the mobility and the ability to also push out the waves before they start moving in as fight. Because if you start falling behind very, very early on, you might be forced to just sit and try and defend towers in three different lanes, and you never get to use that Sivir ulti or the talisman as a team. It happened earlier to, Rocket who faced SK Gaming. They were just forced to sit and try and defend the side lanes.
Simply couldn't do it. Got themselves put into that position. So we do see Diamond Prox moving his way through the jungle. Stole that red buff on a very cheeky invade, but gets away clean. Still got his own buff to play with, and we did see Cabochon picked up some wards and potions. and teleported up to that top lane. He's already bullying Chachi around with that level advantage.
And I really like when people take the ward from that camp to do a level one, because it allows them then to play super aggressive in the start of the lane. They can go in, they can start trading between the minion waves. You know Shin is going to stand there himself. I'm not sure how much farm Kabuto can deny from Chachi. Shin is a fairly safe laner in that sense. But the kill pressure, it's going to come from Kickers. Taunt the Hecarim, Kickers then has to land the spear and do the most of the damage if they want to take him down. And funny enough, or expected, I guess, he misses the first one on the rift shot.
Remember, folks, the easiest shot is the one most often missed. And he gets the crab at the end of the day. He's going to be looking to invade. So look at Diamond's positioning. How is he flying? This is a weird start as far as the jungle buffs are concerned.
I would really have preferred if Diamond just took the red buff, went straight to his own blue buff, secured that one, so there was no chance for Kickers to go in now and get two buffs himself and also stay around this top side on the map. If you take your camps on top side, Kickers went for the first gank and he found nothing, he wouldn't have been able to really do a whole lot else and just back all the way down to the bottom side of the map, and he would have lost a lot of time. Now he gets a camp, even to go to use on Crooks, and he can potentially gank.
So we see both junglers getting both of the same color buff, and we'll see how their gank pathing works out. You did touch on the bottom half of the map. Vardex and Hillisang have been pushed in heavily by Forgiven and Ghost Pepper, already a 10 CS advantage. And every time I've looked at that mini-map, Vardex and Hillisang, melee support has just been bullied around by Ghost Pepper.
Yeah. It's not fun when your AD carry gets out-traded and your support gets out-traded. It's hard to do anything. Kickers, though, is around the mid lane.
He's going to pounce over. Betsy with a defensive flash. Kickers is going to get that movement speed. He's going to move through. There's the attack into Dissonance. And Kickers secures first blood, looking to sink his fangs into Rek'Sai. The Diamond's going to be able to get away, holding on to that flash. Unicorns on the board.
Very, very good first gank here from Kickers, but also Betsy. Mistake in the mid lane in how he positions himself. He went close to that wall without having any wards on the other side. So very easy for Kickers to gank him. Didn't even have to use the flash. Diamond, of course, not nearby. He was just farming on his own. So first kill for Unicorns, and this is what they need. Yesterday, they tried the same gank. Power Vivo flashed for it, didn't manage to get anything. Then he got ganked himself and died and got set really far behind. This time he gets an assist. Let's see, though, if Diamond want to go in and try and gank his Orianna while the flash is down.
Yeah, and of course, yesterday was against Svensson's Echo. Very ingenious pathing. Diamond's going to have to do a little bit extra work, but on that Rek'Sai has definitely got the capabilities early on.
For sure. But look what Powerweaver's doing. He did the same thing before. Tier early, and then he goes into Morello and Nomicon, so he's putting so much focus on stacking mana and mana regen early on, so he can just sit and spam his ball here and act as a very safe wave clear, but it's setting him behind a lot in the mid game. It's making him very weak, and he needs that Seraph Embrace before he really starts spiking down two items. And I think it's very risky on an Orianna because your damage is really not there.
Maybe Power of Evil's got that item set stuck from AP Cog in the middle lane. Still playing that same style. If given the time, he can eventually get to that power, but Unicorns of Love have not often been given that much time. So we're going to have a look at back up at this top lane. Chachi's got that Bami Cinder to return to lane with. Even on CS with Cabochard, despite that early pressure. And this is exactly what you talked about, Official. We weren't expecting too much in that particular lane. Hillisang, though, is going to go for the headbutt pulverize. Boomerang Blade from Vardex puts a good trade, but Diamond is sniffing around. If Vardex and Hillisang stick around, they're going to be in trouble. Here comes Diamond Frost. He's got the flash. He gets a two-man knockup. Vardex with an early summon, a heal. He should be out clean as Hillisang pulverizes the ground once more. And it did cost both the Vardex summoners.
A nice little gank coming in here. Unicorns of Love have been behind in this bottom lane, and it's not exactly going to get a lot better. We mentioned in Champ Select how BF Sword for Lucian, something's ability starts scaling really well with the AD, and he's just going to outshine the Sivir. Add in the fact that you have a Tier Orianna in the mid lane and a Shen top lane. Unicorn's Love is not going to have a lot of damage in the mid game. They're not going to be able to match Gambit in that case, so they're going to have to play super defensive and try and play around pushing waves and towers instead of straight up team fighting, unless they can create a pick.
We'll see if they can. For the time being, Unicorns do have that advantage, thanks to First Blood, of course.
Not a lot of big options, though.
Finds out. Hillisang goes in for another aggressive trade. Then comes out the better of that one. Thanks, of course, to that Triumphant Roar. Big Wave pushing up, and again, Forgiven and Ghost Pepper pushing heavily. 20 CS advantage in this bottom lane. The duo's working up for now.
And once Forgiven goes back to base and gets that BF sword, then I want to see Gambit continue to play around this bottom lane. It's your strongest lane at the moment. It's where you know you're going to be able to push it into the Tower of Unicorns of Love again and again and again. Then, of course, you have to worry about the Shen, but you are so strong just in the 2v2 with some backup from a TP or your jungler, you should be able to take down that tower and start speeding up and get into this mid game here.
We'll see if they can. We did see Diamond briefly show his face top. No real gank opportunity, but could have been there if Kikis was around. And I just want to touch on the fact that this game is going to be slightly different from what has actually got Gambit their 3 respective wins. Forgiven's farming very well, but he's got a lot of support from that Lulu and Bard. And, you know, leading up to this game, yesterday we actually heard Betsy saying how it's not Gambit learning to play with Forgiven, it's Forgiven learning to play with Gambit. All the damage percentages and farm, everything's leading in that favor. Forgiven playing the cleanup role as the rest of Gambit are setting him up for success.
Forgiven has not been the main carry for Gambit whenever they've been winning. And he seems to be happy with it, or at least he's not publicly complaining about it if he's not happy. So I also think for him it suits the style of Gambit from last win. And I think Forgiven is just such a good AD carry that he can play all these different styles. He doesn't have to be the main carry. He can play cleanup. He has great positioning. He knows when to go in, when to push his advantage, and when to play defensive. So Forgiven is just all around a very versatile AD carry. And that's early pressure on the tower.
The thing is, that's a sentence that you would not have said in spring.
True.
Forgiven is a versatile.
But he didn't have to play all the styles. He needed to play that carry style. There was no other way with the way SK were playing.
Yeah, it's interesting to see how one player, how drastically different it can be depending on the rest of your teammates. It's easy to look good when everybody's playing well. Much more challenging when everybody needs to step up, of course. So Forgiven again with that lead. Look across the board. Power of Evil's got a CS advantage over Betsy. Betsy, of course, gave up first blood. Forget that. Lost a little bit of presence. A lot of tower damage traded bottom lane, but nothing should fall yet as we reach that tower.
With Betsy just walking out to take that blue buff beforehand, Unicorns Love have the time on it because Kikis took the first blue buff in the game, if you guys remember. So they knew they could suddenly invade into the jungle, take away the red buff, and set up a trap for Diamond. He's not spotting him, they're standing still.
Oh, and he's eaten the javelin toss. Kikis has gone in. Pounced for his second kill of the game.
And this whole build-up, as you just said before here, it starts from Kikis taking the first blue buff. He times it and he says it's now alive. Whenever Betsy leaves the lane, he's going to that blue buff, so he's going to be on the top side. We can easily invade in, set up a trap, take a red buff, go for Betsy, miss your pulverizer. That's not the plan, though.
Not this time around. Kikis is going to sidestep, does get caught by a shockwave. Now Betsy's in trouble, but does not eat a javelin toss. Kikis should be able to get out of this one alive. As they make the tower golden, Ghost Pepper trying to hold on to it for as long as he can.
Great pressure play here from Unicorns, though. Power of Evil is just constantly pushing down the mid lane every time he has the chance. Remember, Betsy died to that very first gank as well. That cost him a lot of damage on his tower. It set him behind in CS. Power of Evil has not let go. He's just kept applying that pressure. Now Diamond going on Hillsang.
Well, Hillsang does have Unbreakable Will, and he throws it down. Diamond proxies. Thinking about backing off. There's not a lot of support in damage here from Gambit. Ghost Pepper's moving up, but he's used Tempered Fate already. It does seem like that aggressive play is going to fizzle. Deficio, Unicorns of Love are making proactive plays, which is something they did not do yesterday. And in contrast, Gambit are the ones with some situational errors.
It seems like the Unicorns of Love have had a plan now, and they follow that plan. They said, we get that blue buff, we know when it spawns, then we make an invade in, we try and potentially set up a trap if the chance is there. They went for the dragon as well, went for Forgiven with recalling and said, we know we're gonna lose this bot tower fairly soon anyway, so we need to get something for it. Okay, take the dragon instead, delay our own recall. Bardock now just gonna give it up, Forgiven, of course, keeping the pressure going, extending that CS lead. But it feels like Unicorns have had a plan for the early game, and that's something they've been lacking or missing before. Diamond now, he's just gonna double tunnel his way out.
Yeah, finds his way out, but we do see the first tower falling. It's Forgiven pushing it down as Ghost Pepper's moved around the map to roam.
And right now here for Gambit, you have a Shen sitting top lane. One of the reasons Shen wasn't that strong in the meta beforehand was his lack of wave clear. There was just no control really from him, so you could very easily start pushing in against him. ChapoChat has been doing it. Now when you have a Bard and a Lucian, you can very easily swap your duel into the top side, take another tower. Chachi's not going to be able to defend it on his own. And then you just need ChapoChat to sit in the bottom lane and stop URL from taking that one. And then suddenly you try and once again, you speed up the game. You say, no more laning phase. We want to start fighting here in the mid game.
We'll see if Unicorns can find that fight. We do see an early Archangel star from Power of Evil. First big item completed. Chachi's got that Sunfire Cape. So in terms of some of those first item backs, Roel sitting a little more comfortably for the time being. Cabochard seems to be coming off worse for wear against that Sunfire Cape because he's only got boots, a longsword, and a ruby crystal. But he's still farming very well, and we know the impact that those Home Guard teleport ganks will have, especially with Dragon coming up in a minute.
That is a place, though, or a situation where Shen could work really well. If you know how important it is for him to get off that Home Guard, the Shen ulti and the fact he also has a TP, he's going to give him a few more tools to try and react time and time again. But Unicorns, they've been winning this mid lane from the first gank they pull off. They now get a tower instantly back into the jungle of Gambit. One of the reasons for this Nidalee pick is the fact he can go for these aggressive invades. Kick has been spending more time in Diamond's jungle than his own.
And what a difference from yesterday. Unicorns tried that mid lane gank, it didn't work. And Kick has got invaded upon many, many times. It was Power of Evil that got pressured. And Kick has couldn't fight, of course. Picks and bans has something to do with that. But Unicorn's going to be sitting happier. We're getting close to the 15-minute mark. And to just talk a little bit more about how Gambit seemed to be interacting is in terms of 20 minutes and later, the farm priority in who gets those side lanes, who gets those minion lanes, actually favors Cabochard and Betsy.
Yeah.
Forgiven is lower down the priority list. In spring, he used to be number one out of AD carries and picking that up.
And that is
right now
like number one by far.
He's number nine. Every other AD carry, barring one, picks up more CS after 20 minutes than Forgiven does. As a team decision, as a farm priority, in how the teams are playing the game.
There's the change we keep talking about. Gambit also is a team that doesn't necessarily feel like they have to get these early dragons, and I quite like that, because if you can get early towers instead, completing an item is going to have so much more value than getting two or three stacks from a dragon. And as long as they manage to go in and stop UOL with the potential goalie they're going to build up if they keep taking down towers, they're going to be able to match them as a third or fourth dragon anyway and fight for that one. Top lane here, we talked about how they could swap Forgiven up there, push it in very easily. Already gotten the first tower, and now mid lane is the last one. UOL has sent too many members to the top side already to defend this one. All five of them now have to run down to try and stop the push on mid lane.
Well, let's see if they can. One thing I do want to talk about is just how many wards are on this minimap. Gambit have littered the top half of the map from that previous invade, and Unicorns of Love, they've got some pretty good deep vision down to Gambit's top half of the map. The area that's somewhat lacking is ironically Cabochard, who's fairly extended. He does have information to work with. He knows where his opponents are. Telesun going for another invade. Kick is Javelin Toss. Gonna be late, blocked by smaller Sentinels. But there's those wards. You can see Unicorns of Love. They've got vision on Betsy. They've got vision on Diamond. They're working with information.
That's where Unicorns have played really well around this mid lane here. Around Power of Evil, getting off to a great start. We'll have to see what the next item is for him. Yesterday was the Morel Nomicon, because you really want that cooldown reduction for yourself. Obviously, he just had the goal once and went back to complete that Seraph, and then you go straight for it. That's often how it goes with these items for professional players. There's not always a specific reason for the order that gets. It's also depending on how much gold you have when you do back, if you manage to complete it or start building towards a new one. Now, though, they have been able to respond, getting down towers as well. So they've done a very good job reacting to Gambit and saying, we don't want to team fight you. We're just going to try and stick it to the laning phase and get objectives instead.
They're going to be matching toe for toe, blow for blow. Unicorns with a very, very small lead. Not something we've said before 20 minutes, much this split. Unicorns of Love have traditionally been down and pulled it back because of those scaling team compositions. This time around, they've got the dragon advantage, they've got kill advantage. They've also had pretty decent jungle pressure.
They have.
Onto Diamond, coordinated and with numbers. Power of Evil, gonna respect the Tempered Fate and flash away. Does that give up control in the middle lane?
Well, he still has a wave thing, still full HP. He just flashed instantly, didn't want to take any chance. So no, he should be able to defend it. Obviously, Gambit might be able to make a follow-up play. But the coordination you just talked about before, that's the thing. What Unicorns of Love normally do is they take very risky plays. And they don't really calculate in, okay, what's the reward here, or how risky is it? Is there a chance we might give up two or three kills, and so on? No, they just go for it anyway. They react on the fly. They say, I can go for this one, and everyone follows. That has really been a problem for them, because it's been too easy for other teams to react and counter it. This game here, even though they've been evading in, taking buffs, you know, diving a few times around the mid lane, it's been low risk, because they had information on Gambit, they had the pressure in the lanes, and that's a change. But it's why Unicorns right now are ahead in this game.
We're getting closer to 20 minutes. Getting closer to pressure on these mid towers from Unicorns of Love, or the bottom tower from Gambit. Those are the last outer turrets remaining. And traditionally, once those fall, then the deep wards become even more prolific and invade. See which team manages to make it work first. Vardex, however, he's down on CS. Vardex is down at CS versus Forgiven, but Power of Evil is up. So let's see
I'm happy
who's going to have a bigger
trade.
Impact.
I'm happy taking that one. I'd rather have my Orianna being ahead in farm than my Sivir. Vardex can offer enough with what he has at the moment, and you really want this Orianna, especially when you go for Tia Morel and Omicron, to get into that late game. And Betsy!
Oh, Betsy's going to be in trouble. Wild Growth comes up. He's going to be able to flash away. That's a two-man stun from Gosu Pepper. Cosmic Binding saving his mid laner's life. And they get away clean.
Alright, so Gambit. Once again, getting ganked in the mid lane. Betsy forced to flash away. Unicorns keeping very good control around this lane again and again. The next dragon is where we're going to have to see if Gambit want to start taking a fight. Otherwise, Unicorns might be able to just sit back and wave play with Orianna Sivir for a lot longer and get to that late game point for Power of Evil.
Oh, Betsy definitely felt the threat of that. Unicorns of Love champion, much like Diamond, felt the threat of the Wraith King. We did see a brief glimpse of Cabochard up top. He's picked up that Trinity Force now. Got to be feeling a bit more comfortable. Forgiven's getting closer to his static shift. Remember, Betsy, no flash. So if he does get caught by Hillisan, should be enough CC or damage to take him out.
I want to see the setup here from both teams around the dragon. I would love to see a pink ward where Vardex is right now. He just walked into the small bush. But on the other side of the wall, they're near the mid tower of Unicorns of Love, because it's going to stop Cabochard from having that wall to TP to. And it allows you to get a potential flank with your own Alistar by moving down there and denying all that vision away from Gambit. Because it's going to be about, you know, this next dragon. If Unicorns keep getting them, suddenly we have that potential five dragons. Gambit also needs to find a way where they can get a team fight while they still have a nice amount of damage from the Lulu, from your Lucian.
There is one thing you have to highlight though. If team fights break out and go a little bit messy, Gambit has way more damage to play with on the condition they don't get hit by multi-man shockwaves or multi-man knockouts.
It's what we mentioned with the Shen top. I mean, that's of course what you sacrifice. He doesn't really add a whole lot of damage. So you need your AD carry in your mid lane to provide it. Gambit is running the triple threat comp you see so often in Europe, even with also with the Rek'Sai. So that's why.
Threats.
Three and a half, let's agree on that one. And look here, Gambit, they're here around the dragon. They want to fight for it. Back in base, we have Cabochard sitting. Where's the wards behind him? There's one near that mid tower of Unicorns I mentioned before, and he's pinging on it right now. That's going to be the one he wants to TP to.
We'll see if he does. Has not started channeling it yet.
It just disappeared.
Right, is available for him. Not going to be able to find that opportunity. Chachi's just made his way to that top lane, but it is pushing towards Gambit anyway. And Unicorns of Love, they've got Scuttle Crab control. That is important to note. Cabochard's still in base.
There's no wards for him right now. There was one left near the mid tower. It disappeared. So at the moment, Gambit has zero deep wards against the Unicorns of Love. So it's hard for Cabochard to find a good place to land his teleport. And they need it to secure a victory in that fight, stop the dragons, and open up this game for Gambit themselves, and not allow Unicorns to play this passive style.
So we'll see whether or not Unicorns can get into this third dragon. They do appear to have found an opportunity. There's a ward on the right-hand side of the minimap in the tri-bush, and Cabochard wants to go to it.
But he's stuck in his lane against the Shen who can taunt him.
So we'll see if they can. Dragon secured. Almost uncontested. Gambit really not able to, but we do see Vardax. He's thrown down on the hunt. They've set their sights on Diamond Crocs. We are going to see Kickers pouncing over, and the Shockwave is just going to help for an assist. Kill credit to Vardax with Diamond Crocs down. Are they going to go to Baron? This is a brave, brave
two
pull.
Guys on the bottom
game.
Lane for Gambit here. Eddie and Forgiven were moving down to clear the bot lane wave. So five members from Unicorns on the Baron. Forgiven is not going to help. This is going to be about Betsy and Kaposhard. And goes to Pepper. It's going to stun the Baron.
So Baron is golden. Tempered Fate going to delay this one. This will only be the third Baron Unicorns of Love will have secured if they can. Gambit are looking to challenge. Hillisang wants to peel them away. Baron secured by Vardax as he auto attacks it down. Betsy forced to Wild Growth himself and he eats a boomerang blade, sending him to the grave. They've lost, Gambit have lost Baron and Betsy, but they have taken one tower and Chachi's going to defend.
Yeah, and Unicorns have a way in the top side. They even go for Kaposhard.
Kaposhard's in trouble. The Cougar's on his back on sort of shadows to get away. And he does manage to make it out, but Unicorns with Baron-empowered minions are looking to accelerate this game at 23 minutes.
Love the play here for them. Everything around that dragon here was set up with the pink wards. There was no wards from Gambit behind them, so there was no good way to teleport. As soon as Kaposhard showed himself in lane, they just started. They know Chachi can taunt him if he tries to TP. No chance for Gambit to fight. This game here has been played very, very slow paced from Unicorns, but it's been all about the mid lane and that control they've set up to invade in and stop Gambit from making any aggressive plays.
And talk about the tools that Unicorns now have. Not only do they have Baron, they have Stand United and Teleport available for Visit Chachi. So many ways for them to press their advantage. Here's this Baron fight once more.
Baron fights. Betsy is like...
Okay, maybe fight's a strong word.
I'm gonna try. I'm not sure what you want to try, but he's obviously just gonna go down. Baron goes down as well. Forgiven to try and trade it for a tower in the bot lane. And Chachi in this game here. Not a single ulti. Don't think he's used teleport at all either. Because there's been nothing for him to do, seeing as Gambit has been unable, after losing that mid lane so hard, to make any plays on the map, Unicorns just slowly take every single dragon away from them. Power Weevil now getting towards that three item spike. He has his fully stacked tier, so now he's really, really powerful. And there's so much wavelength between him and Vardax as well to just stop their easy pushes from Gambit.
The scary thing is, it's only a 2,500 gold lead, but the amount of control feels significantly higher. We'll see whether or not Unicorns can continue this level of control. We are going to take that outer turret down. They do have Chachi, as you mentioned, with Stand United up top. Gambit are grouped, though. Let's see whether or not they can find a team fight against this massive minion wave. Oh, very well farmed Unicorns of Love.
Gambit minions. There's an engage, potentially.
Only onto Hellasang, though. We do see Stand United comes out. Diamond Prox gets the knockup. Kaposhard is trying to trample him down, but he's not going to be able to find anyone. He will be going down shortly as Vardax lands one more of those ricochets. Now Chachi's on the defensive, trying to get away. Gambit look relatively healthy, but they're down in numbers until Betsy eats that javelin from Kickers. That's a flash. The Shockwave pulls Forgiven backwards, and he will be going down. Unicorns of Love lose Hellasang. But that is it. They will get the tower, and it looks like Kickers is going to get stunned against the wall. You can see that stack line up top, 16 deaths, tying the entirety of the Spring Split games for Forgiven. Not working out for Gambit today. Unicorns onto the next inhibitor turret as Kickers sinks his fangs in, gets one more kill against Gambit.
First ulti from Chachi. Didn't have to do anything before. He taunted Ghost Pepper.
Oh, Goshu's down!
But that team, like everything from the Unicorns, they knew what was going to happen. You know, there's going to be an engage. Gambit has to try and do something. Ult in on whatever target it is. Flash out. Vardax was untouched as well. And you just see how strong this 5-on-5 combo is once they've started to scale up towards that late game.
DeFicio, Unicorns of Love are the CLG of Europe. Because they break your hearts one day and give you hope another. Here's another look at this team fight.
Yeah, so it's a good engage from Gambit. They get a mass knockoff here. They have to fear from Kaposhard, but the problem is now they're starting to fall a bit behind in damage as well. And also, Stand United, even a heal from Kickers, the shield from Power Weevil himself, and the fact you have all your summoners ready is enough for you all to stop the engage, to stop him dying. And this is a beautiful combo. Hillsing going in with the ball on him. Forgiven goes down.
Doesn't matter, only hit one man. One man's the damage dealer. Worked out in favor. So, Unicorn, super minions in two lanes. You know, when we were in about 18 minutes, I was starting to get myself thinking this is going to be a long one, we're in for a slow game. And in the course of the last six or seven, Unicorns have just completely skyrocketed away. And now they're going to start poking down with that Orianna ball, with the Nidalee javelins, with the boomerangs. And Gambit very soon are going to have to deal with multiple super minions in their base.
Yeah, there's a ward behind. Kapushad is sitting in base. This might be the last chance for Gambit. Just try and all in engage. See if you can get onto someone like Power Vivo or Valix. There's no flash on the carries. TP is coming in now.
Well, Chachi's the only one that gets hit by Temp and Fate. Gosu didn't have the greatest ultis yesterday, and he's not having the greatest today. Betsy will get caught out against the wall in Unicorns of Love. They've at least thwarted the threat of the engage from Hecarim, and now the super minions are into the base. You see them cresting those steps. Unicorns have bided their time using the sustain from Alistar, and they're onto the next inhibitor turret. Nothing Gambit can do. Hillisung hates those minions, knocks them up in the air. All three inhibs are down, Deficio.
So many super minions, five guys from UL as well. They got Diamond.
Well, Diamond's gonna be dropping Javelin in the behind. Unicorns get kill number 10. They're onto the Nexus turret as Gosu's being zoned away. One is down, supers are gonna help on the next one. And the Unicorns of Love will break their losing streak to take down Gambit and go 4-4 on the splits.
And they could be very happy here. But such a different Unicorns of Love compared to what we have seen the last few weeks, where it's just like all in aggression, don't really care about what the risk is, and end up getting it bad early on that sets them super far behind. In this game here, everything seemed to be under control. It all started with that first gank on Betsy in the mid lane where he positions himself next to a wall. Easy for Kickers to get it. Means they win the mid lane. They use that to then invade in on these buffs here, find Diamond in there, and they start taking control around that mid lane, stopping Gambit from quickly taking down all out of turrets and speeding up the game, get into that mid game in an open map where you can team fight against a Tia Orianna. That never happened because of that mid lane. And it simply just stopped any aggression from Gambit.
So very impressive performance from UOL. The decision making was not there yesterday for the team, but it is today. And you can see Betsy on your screen at the moment. Definitely feeling the exact opposite that Sheepy currently is. Big smiles in his face. But we have to keep talking about it. It is not the same performance. It is not the same decision making. This time around, almost everything was great. Unicorns, they played safe, they played controlled, they had the vision game. They played Baron effectively. I mean,
it's a mystery. I don't get it. I don't get it. How you go from being this
an Origin versus Froggen, who we just heard from, and Elements. First, let's dial into Origin with Soaz, amazing. Xpeke in the mid lane, then Nils, Mithy, and Ludduk. As said, after a flawless start in the first couple of weeks, a couple of losses under their belt now, and in this one, they are up against Elements, who haven't quite found as much success as Origin yet. This split with JWoww, Dexter, Froggen, Tabs, Promise Q, and Niff. So, looking at both teams, maybe starting with Origin, because yesterday they had that huge matchup versus Fnatic. They did better, in my opinion, playing from behind, although they were down 1,500 gold at 20 minutes. I feel like there was a little bit more bounce to their step after being behind than it was versus Rocket.
I just feel like it was a nice game to watch, and both teams showed why they're so good at the game. And they took Fnatic to lengths. Yes, Fnatic eventually came out on top, but yeah, Cyanide's former teammates looked strong, and they might actually end up beating my former teammate. Not looking forward to that one.
Maybe. A lot of speculation we've done about, well, you know, what is OG's view on the macro level of the game, of when they get later in the game and they have those big decisions to make. In my opinion, they are still untested. What do you guys think?
I kind of agree with you there. Like, I think the strong point of Origin is like the early game and like the aggression they put out, which I think is going to work really well against Elements, because Elements really struggle in the early. They don't really do anything, and that's just going to get their Nexus destroyed.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. Elements have been playing very, very slow, and both of their victories, they had an incredibly slow early game. The one game they got off Rocket, I believe, slowest first spot in the LCS, and then we have to go back all the way to week one, where they almost lost the game against a tower push from Gambit, but eventually they got rolling and they got that scaling in there. But Yeah, it's sloppy, lacking. The only person really with a bit of initiative is Dexter right now in that lineup, whereas if you look at Origin, everybody's bringing it to the table, except maybe Xpeke, but they didn't really need him all too much so far.
Yeah, if we take a look at the stats for that early game, Elements, 16 kills and 25 deaths in the first 15 minutes. Origin, 28 kills and 19 deaths in the first 15 minutes. A lot, of course, of those deaths coming of the games, the two they just lost. But logically speaking, Elements should have a super hard time in this matchup. Are you expecting anything else coming out of them?
No, I just think that probably Origin is going to get the early lead and snowball over them. However, like always when you play aggressive, it can backfire. Maybe Dexter is at a really good location to counter gank Amazing or something like that, or they just go for a dragon. So I think like maybe a good counter gank by Dexter can really turn the game around. But otherwise, I think Origin will take this pretty easily.
And there's surprisingly little hype around the mid lane matchup here, Xpeke against Froggen, whereas if you would have, you know, asked that like a year ago or 2 years ago, like that was the pinnacle matchup right now. But we see Elements struggling a little bit, and Origin saying we're not a mid lane centric team. So it's kind of surprising to see like two legends in the mid lane face off and there be relatively little hype about it. It's more about the teams, about the, you know, the way they play and they approach the game rather than just that specific matchup.
Yeah, maybe they decide to go legendary in this one. We will see. Now, before we head over to the desk, let's see what you wanted to ask Cyanide from @Porukun. If pulling a Mad Life is predicting dodges with a hook, what would be pulling a Cyanide?
This.
Holy shit.
Very clever. Looks very clever. But probably like Baron stealing. I'm really hard trying to come up with something witty here, but I can't. So stealing a Baron, Drake, whatever.
Judging plays by human body parts. Yeah. Pulling a Cyanide.
Yeah.
That could be a thing.
There we go. And with that, the stage is definitely set. So we're going to kick it over to the casters for picks and bans.
Nipples.
Thank you very much, Shox. We'll see if anybody can pull a Cyanide this game. But I do want to reiterate what Krepa was saying. You know, Xpeke versus Froggen, this was one of the marquee matchups. You go back a couple of years, throw an Alexic into the mix, and that would have been
the default. Oh, mid laners, top laners.
Bjergsen was one of the up-and-comers.
Yeah.
The thing is, can old dogs learn new tricks? That's the question. Froggen has not necessarily done a whole lot. His Echo has been impressive.
Same for Pekka, though.
Team's not worked around it.
I feel like both mid laners. I mean, Pekka, as we talk about so often, Origin is not playing around him in the mid lane. They don't need him to do super well. He lost the laning phase yesterday against Forbidden in the Azir Victor matchup. Froggen, individually, I feel like he's had good games, especially on Echo. He's Vladimir yesterday once he got to the late game. But he's also like, he's the vocal point of this team here. And he was the guy saying on the analyst desk how, yes, I know we play passive, but it's the only way we're winning. So he feels like this is a good style for Elements, but it's also one of the reasons they've lost so many games, because they just fall so far behind and do nothing the first 20 minutes.
Well, we'll find out if they can find a higher gear this time around. Kalista, one of those champions that you've talked about, high priority. I feel like, yes, these are fairly targeted bans. Promiscue undefeated on the Alistar. Mythi's had some great Alistar performances. You know, Kalista's a strong priority for actually both of these teams, really. Mm-hmm. What is left up? Jungler's untouched.
Do
mid
we need to say the AD carry?
Untouched.
Good old Sivir.
First pick worthy?
Against Elements? Yeah. I mean, what's going to happen now is if Elements decides to ban a tier 1 jungler, they might get Origin to first pick the other jungler there and therefore get the Sivir for them, which I think is super important for how passive they play the early games. That's exactly what Elements are doing. They're telling Origin, if you don't take that Rek'Sai now, we're going to grab it for Dexter on our side, and then you can get your Sivir, but at least we get something. We trade it. There are other strong picks open as well. I mean, Jayce has been banned quite a lot. We've seen it a few times. I think it's a strong pick here on 5-11. I don't know if Elements want to play it, but they're going to get the Rek'Sai instead. So I like the last ban on the Gragas here.
And of course, Dexter's been the man that's really been carrying Elements. I think he's had some of the better performances across the board, across most of the games. And I still think Froggen played very well. Yesterday's Vladimir was very impressive in the late game. It took a long time to get there, but there was no pressure from Elements. They weren't under a rush from Rocket.
They will be here.
Origin a lot more aggressive.
A lot more, and also taking away the Sivir, you remove a key wave clear factor from Elements, and you get that ability to control the tempo of the game. You can now fast push, you can engage fights very easily with the Sivir ulti. So that's why I really like the pickup from Origin, even though it means to get a second tier jungler for Amazing. I still think it's very worth it with how Elements have been playing and how important I think that pick is for them.
Let's find out.
I like it. If you go Azir now and you get Azir, Sivir, and Nuno, you have a fantastic team composition for both the early game in terms of you have safe lanes and your team fights are going to be very, very strong. Good scaling to the late game and a lot of ways you can play around it. Nuno also specializes in shutting down the enemy jungler, making him as useless as Nuno is himself. And that's one of the reasons we have seen it before into a Rek'Sai.
The thing is, yesterday, Pekka did play that Azir. It did not go well for him. That was against Febiven's Victor. We know Froggen also likes to play Victor, has tried that himself. Instead, Pekka's going to go to a champion that has worked for him, and he's locking in a fairly early Vladimir. This is a change. Traditionally, that's been in reply to what his opponents are putting on the board.
Yeah, I think maybe he was afraid of Froggen going Vladimir as a last pick into the Azir. It's a matchup we've seen a few times where the Vladimir, at least late on in the game, does really well. You can also pull under the ulti of Azir, but I still feel like that would have been a better pick, unless, of course, this Vladimir goes to the top lane. I mean, it is technically a flex pick. We've seen Jumbo play Vlad top a few times, but let's see what Origin decides to do later on. Elements now cannot fall in the same trap we have seen time and time again, where they pick low wave clear, no pressure in the early game. They have the Rek'Sai, that's a great start. They have a top laner who can rush a Trinity Force, that's another good start for them. Let's see what AD carry we get for taps.
Well, Corki does appear to be locked in. There is some of that wave clear you were talking about. Another Trinity Force spike and the Morgana. It is, of course, one of the highest win ratio champions at the moment. I think we said it was 11 wins, 2 losses, if memory serves correctly. And that's going to be landing in Promiscu's hands. Froggen giving himself the chance to pick whatever he wants into Origin, as Origin will be locking in most likely the mid lane and support.
Very standard for Elements. I believe they are the team in Europe who last picks the mid lane the most often. And that's what we have seen time and time again when you have Froggen on the team here. Corki, Forgiven didn't go for it last game. He wanted the Lucian to be a bully against the Sivir in lane. Taps is probably going to have to sit back. He's not in the best lane matchup for himself. And I'm saying that even before seeing the potential support pick for Origin. But if they do lock in the likes of a Fizz, they can also decide to swap against the Hecarim if there's no smite from JWoww. And simply try and dodge around that one. And Annie is, of course, fantastic at roaming early on as well. So there's multiple options in how Origin wants to play this early game.
We have seen that. Will, of course, be Soaz's Fizz up in the top lane. So we know their team composition has now been rounded out. Nunu's not necessarily going to have the greatest of targets to Bloodboil, but both Fizz and Sivir will be greatly appreciative of the movement speed and attack speed. What does Froggen pick into this very, very frustrating set of targets? Vlad and Fizz going to duck and dive, and Sivir's going to run around in circles.
So you have Corki AD carry that can open up potentially for Jace, and you have an absolutely fantastic mid-game spike. Sadly, then you have the Hecarim top lane, so you will be stacking a lot of physical damage. That's going to be a problem later on in the game. We know Source is going to stack armor. We know Amazing is going to do the same. But that would give Elements a chance to try and battle Origin early in the game and not have to wait for late game, because at the moment, I mean, the Corki, of course, isn't scaling that well to the late game. Nuno as well, fairly good in the late game himself in terms of buffing up other people. So, oh well, I mean, it's hard to call Nuno good in the late game, but like his blood boil gets pretty
like
good.
You don't like Nuno.
I had a 3v3 match with Power of Evil where he forced me to play Nuno because I was so useless. But I won, but it gave me new hate somewhat for it.
The only other person that I've heard speak with such disdain about a champion was Kobe. MSI, but we'll get back to that in a moment. Froggen has opted into the Azir versus Vladimir matchup. It's one that Xpeke has won 2 out of the 3 times he's played it.
Yeah, and the one I feel like Xpeke was trying to dodge by taking the Vladimir himself, because Azir would have fit in so well for Origin in many ways.
Well, we'll find out whose plan will backfire as we are going to be loading up onto the Rift in just a moment or two. Great, great play thus far from Origin up until their 2 losses recently. A little bit of cracks in the armor are starting to show through. And Elements, they picked up a win yesterday. Picked up a win that they'll be hoping to duplicate today with their 2 team compositions. So let us know who you think is going to be winning this one. Open up your Twitter and let us know. Origin, team that is currently 3rd in the league. Can they pick up another win?
Well, I don't think Elements is going to challenge him that much in the early game compared to what we have seen before, at least.
Well, we'll find out, because of course for Origin it's all about finding the aggression. For Elements, it's about figuring out if they can handle the aggression. We're loading up onto the Rift for the last time here in week 4. And let's find out whether or not these teams are pretenders or contenders. It's Origin versus Elements.
And just reading some of the Twitter comments from some of the Elements players after they managed to win yesterday, it was very clear it meant so much to them. They had some bad games, some bad weeks, and suddenly they managed to turn it around at least a little bit. I want to see if that confidence has done something. At least we see more wave clear coming from the Froggen in the laning phase on this Azir. We'll do fine. The Vladimir, once he starts gets a bit of scaling going in, he can be a bit annoying, but I feel like it's a skill matchup in this mid lane here. But Froggen can't push it into the tower of Xpekka here, and that's gonna hopefully open up some options for Dexter to play a bit more aggressive. Taps is gonna play his ward. Let's see if Origin can kill it. Once it puts it down, it becomes very predictable with these invades in here. If you want to try and spot the early swaps, and that's why they were just waiting around the corner here. They're not trying to kill Taps or anything, they just want his ward.
So you can teach old dogs new tricks. It's amazing as Soros waited to kill that ward. It's not something we've seen, I think, at all. But small advantage to Origin. Do touch on the fact Mithy is running that coin as the starting item. Minions has spawned. We'll see how quickly he can get to upgrade or roam around. Mithy's played Annie 3 times this split. Lost yesterday with it.
Mm-hmm. Had 3 bans against him from Fnatic.
Yep.
Went for the Annie, even though that's still a very, very good pick for Mithy. Didn't really manage to have too much impact in the game. Anyway, we're going to get a lane swap coming in from Origin. We mentioned this option here. When your top laner runs with the smite, it gives you just a small edge in the swap here. Double jungling becomes more effective. You can even use the smite in your lane phase to get a bit of extra farm. And also having this Annie can roam so effectively from Mithy's side. We know Sivir can handle herself, but the lane is not frozen, so Origin will have to put Soas and Amazing on this top side while they push in the wave. So they don't want to give any farm to JWoww. Now it's mission, shut down JWoww from the start.
We'll see how they can do it. Mithy, he's read the document, gonna get a rampage, holds onto the stun, does not actually use it just yet. Gonna start messing around with the ramble back, 400 HP, and JWoww should be able to secure this one. Auto attack, because oh, he steals it!
No way.
Look at Origin! They were smiling and giggling! An auto attack!
And look here, because Elements were so delayed in trying to take that red buff, it bought time for Origin to send in Amazing and Mithy, or sorry, Amazing and Soas to start taking away some camps as well. Force Elements out of the jungle. We have the 4v0 on the top side. Gonna be slightly delayed for Elements on the bottom lane. We just saw a quick Binding fly in the mid lane from Promise Q, pulled away from Pekka.
Break this down.
Ah, 36 damage. And he's wonders away.
Wow, Observers with the PJ Salt. Really just twisting that knife as it's jabbed in. And that's going to slow Dexter down in terms of his clear. He did get his hands on his blue buff though, so that's going to be very important. But let's see whether or not that's going to impact him. And I think, considering Elements wanted to get off to a strong early to mid game, maybe that could slow it down.
But now that we've, you know, hit week 4, we've seen these teams here play a lot of games. We start seeing some of the same strategies from Origin. Whenever they lane swap to top, at least a few games I remember where they've been doing it, they always start on the weak side with Amazing. He takes his own red buff first, even though his dual lane is on the top side, starting to push that one in. And nobody invades on him to stop him, so he gets that red buff. Then he moves up to the top side of the map. It means he's going to secure farm on the bottom side that denies that from Dexter and JWoww when they move down to double jungle themselves in this 4v0. And he then gets to the top side with a small XP advantage, which can end up being a big deal. But for now, it's not going to matter too much. He only got the one red buff, and Mithy, obviously, he stole the other one.
Well, it's important that you highlight that, though, DeFisher, because what we've learned from teams that become predictable, Elements unable to get that dragon. As we start rolling over to the next half of the split. Teams that can review how lane swaps play, how player decisions work out, they can count them. Ghost Who Pepper is a prime example in Spring Split. He would oftentimes be forgiven in lane to go try and bait and delay the double jungle and sometimes gave up kills. Sometimes got caught out because he was reflocked.
Promise Q for Elements a few times. In this split here, has been invading in at level 1 to try and stop a blue buff and died twice on it because teams were just waiting for him with their own dual lane and just killed him, or with the enemy top lane and jungler sitting ready. So there are definitely trends you always see from teams, and sometimes you just gotta set up for the potential punish if they keep doing it. Oftentimes though, with now coaches and analysts and so on, these teams will figure out their own trends because they're trying to see like, okay, what would we do to beat ourselves? Okay, here's what we do often. We need to change it because it's too easy now for the other team to counter it.
Well, we did see Elements trying that dragon, talking about some of the trends and some of the preferences and how they play around dragon. We can have a look at some of those stats in a moment. Average first dragon's quite low. Origin significantly more, but let's also be fair, they have more wins under their belt.
Sure.
So you do get more control of this objective.
Yeah. Earlier dragon as well, because they tend to snowball already from the laning phase. The thing we didn't talk about yet was Origin took the top tower down, but they left a lot of minions alive that is now pushed down to JWoww, so he's not been denied that much. A massive wave has just been picked up from him, while Source is trying to do the same now once the wave is pushing back to him. But you can see the mission of denying the Hecarim didn't really do a whole lot for Origin in this case. They ended up trading towers as well, and right now JWoww can be very happy.
Level advantage, 20 CS advantage.
It's a big wave coming though for Source.
And Source will be able to at least close that gap, but there's not 20 troops there. But he will get close. Something we haven't looked at though is this Xpekka versus Froggen matchup either. Also going very even thus far.
Yeah, it is a farm lane, as we often see from both mid laners, honestly. When Echo's banned away, Froggen goes for the more defensive mid laners. We know Pekka likes to do it. Origin doesn't rely on him in that early game. They're trying to neutralize each other. And if you do manage to get a small advantage, get a bit of damage on the enemy mid tower, it can then snowball later on when the side lanes are suddenly thinking, now we need to really start doing something in here. We want to go in for this mid game. I want to see Dexter go top right now here. Source is level 4, 5 now. He's been poked down. Dexter, if you look at your minimap, killing the Rift Scuttler, he's on his way now. A little bit late, I would have seen this 20 seconds
before. Source was going to die.
20 seconds before to catch that big wave, but let's see if they get him.
Oh, not yet! Ignite! He's down. Let's be honest though, that was so predictable. Level 6 versus level 4. Onslaught and Ignite. Easy peasy,
jungler comes. Yeah, exactly. I mean, this is what happens if you don't bounce the wave when you kill that tower in the lane swap, because the waves start pushing down towards the enemy team. They get a big wave, they get an XP advantage while you have to play safe. And then you just call up your jungler and you go straight in for the dive under this tower here against an under-level champion. Easy play from Elements, amazing, trying to respond the best he can by getting something on the bottom side. We'll get that dragon here, but if this continues in the top lane, then the next dragon could very well go over to Elements.
We'll need to see whether or not JWoww's power on this Hecarim will be enough to counterbalance the utility that Niels will offer Origin through that Sivir. There's a lot of slightly less measurable value in that on the hunt. However, if he just gets obliterated by JWoww, then of course that removes that question entirely, doesn't it?
But let's look at the mid game here. Now that Elements have managed to get farm on the top lane, despite the lanes we've gotten the kill, they're gonna get a fairly standard time Trinity Force. Corki's gonna get the same. Azir needs two items before he can start really pushing in the lane super, super hard. One item should do it in terms of pushing. That means Elements, in a 7-8 minutes time, should start hitting some very, very strong power spikes. They can use that because Pekka's Vladimir is not going to be able to wave there properly if you're pushing into his tower. He has to sit in the minion wave. Fizz is not going to add any wave there. Nuna is not going to add any wave there. It's only Nils who can react there. And suddenly Elements, if they start grouping together, the Corki and the Azir, and have TP on JWoww, they can force plays on Origin.
But it's not something they've been particularly able to do all split long.
That's the why we theory, have to see if
the theory sounds great. I'm just not 100% sure I'm a believer.
We're going to have to see what Elements can do.
Yesterday, when Elements played a scaling mid laner with that Vladimir, it took nearly 30 minutes of gameplay before Elements made plays across the map. JWoww was gifted the farm.
Look what they're doing now, though, Trevor.
Little advantage. Oh, is this proactive? Dark Binding. Is this going to connect? Mithy's in trouble. Been exhausted for the slow. It's taken aware of. All the dog finding misses, but Dexter's there to save the day. And El Froggen grabbed himself a kill.
Promise Q was trying to land that binding, so if Mithya just flashed straight ahead, it would connect onto him, but Mithya just keeps walking. Doesn't flash, didn't even use it after when once knew he was dead. But this opens up the mid lane for Origin. Nils is in here as well.
So they're going to lose Mithy, but they should gain this tower. Dropping very, very low, and no one from Elements is in place.
J-Ward just TP'd somewhere.
Where did he go?
He was
down bottom. Doesn't have assist on the board. And does have a kill, so he was involved in that fight.
Oh.
We just didn't see it because we were focusing on the dark binding of the ship.
Yeah, completely blind here.
It's all right. It's...
How do we miss that big Hecarim?
I don't know, dude.
Well, that happened. Anyway.
Oh, cast. That's the equivalent of flashing in the Wraith Camp for casters. Not missing, not catching that one. We've hit 10 minutes. Elements, 2 kills on the board.
How on earth?
They've got a CS advantage in Hecarim, which you talked about excessively. Even in the AD carries, even in the mid lane. But it's Element that are making moves around the map. Amazing's going to get his hand on that blue buff. Let's see where Elements prioritize their resources. Looks to be top lane for the moment.
He's going back to the top himself. Obviously, we just talked about how there's no wave clear for Sora, so he can't do anything to defend. Elements trying to say, after we just gave over that mid tower, we got to try and trade it back. And we also know that bot lane would be a very easy target for Origin anyway. So they just try and be a bit more proactive and go in and get something ourselves. If they were just sitting back in the lanes, Nunu would walk down, bot boil the Sivir, and they would take this bot tower anyway. Let's see if they can gank Froggen down.
There is a Tibbers available. You see those conquering shifting sand soldiers flying Froggen across the map. We'll see whether or not Froggen can get the same level of bird power from Azir that he once did from Olivia.
All three outer turrets down. I really like the play from Origin before, saying we don't care about our support dying. If you send down everyone, even a teleport, remember, then we're just going to push mid instead. So I feel like Element's overcommitted for that one. And now Origin has opened up the map. Still waiting for Peggy to really scale up. And also Soas, who's been set pretty far behind in this Fizzy. So your two soul laners are not going to be very effective. It's going to be more about Nils. I'm playing around the fact you have three open lanes at the moment. I don't think you really want to get into too many fights against Trinity Force, Corki, and Hecarim.
Well, Trinity Force, Corki is a little while away. Got the components of little bits of everything, but only sitting on 650 gold. So Tabs is going to need a lot more time to farm up. Look at the CS difference against Nils. He's having a strong showing. Mithy is around, does have Flash available, does have Tibbers. And Dragon's up in a minute, so it feels like Origin set their sights on that objective. They appear to want control. They might just get it.
Element's moving down a little bit too early, trying to secure the vision. They needed Taps to push out this bottom lane first so they could start defending these wards here. Never really much point in trying to go in and set them up. You're just going to give them away instantly because your AD carry was sitting and farming in one lane. You have no TP in the top lane either. So very easy for Origin to go in and get control. Mason doesn't really care about the binding. He just wants the ward.
What a weird transaction here. Just trading skill shots for ward kills. And Origin walking away with now absolute vision control. 40 seconds ahead of time. However, there are wards in the pit, at least, for Elements, so they're not completely blind. That may go down shortly. Luckily for them, that crab cannot
disappear
be
soon,
yet.
Though. Should disappear soon before Dragon even spawns. You can clearly see how Origin is making sure they have full control before they decide to take any fights. Don't want to risk J-Wall getting a great flank on them or having to chase through one of these openings here against an Azir wall and the AoE damage from Azir and Corki. So Origin has to be very careful of how they decide to fight it. But I liked this whole setup from them. Slowly, but surely they've taken control.
Yeah, and look at the side lanes. Soez was up top with teleport available. J-Wall still does not have it. Origin timed that. This is a fantastic move. They had Pekka shove out the bottom wave, which Tabs has gone to clear. And an uncontested dragon, a show of force in the river. Vision secured and Dragon locked down.
Really goes back to Elements just over-committing for that one kill in the bot lane. They lost mid tower for it. They used teleport, which of course nobody missed. And then they couldn't fight for the second Dragon, despite having a team that is fairly strong at this point here. They're going to have to wait till they can start sieging around this mid tower. It is the only one standing. Nils, that's also why Origin has put him here in the mid lane to be them, basically the wave. They put Peck in a side lane now, go in your 1v1 as Origin always likes to do. And Nils, he's just on wave clear duty.
Well, we'll see whether or not Elements can get that pressure down. Trinity Force literally just picked up for JY. We've seen the two Cinder Hulks for Soaz and Amazing in their pockets for a little while. Nils is getting closer and closer to that Infinity Egg. He's thinking about 1,000 gold. Actually, I think next time he backs, he should be able to complete it. The big item spikes have been triggered on both sides of the river, but it's Origin that have been more proactive on the map, Elements more proactive in their bloodthirstiness.
Let's look at the ward placement here from Origin. There's one placed in the mid lane behind Froggen at the moment. That is potential TP for Soaz if he gets the chance. He's fighting top though.
Well, we do see Chum the Waters goes down. JWoww did hold on to his Onslaught of Shadows, but he used Ignite in that trade, and Soaz gets away from it.
Time for Tabs though to go back here and shop or go join his team in the mid lane. He just pushed up a big wave in the bottom lane. They already set up this group here. They don't have any proper wards on the flank though, and they don't know what wards is behind them. So Soaz, he's moving in, and Nils, again, is the only wave clear for Origin. Now Tabs joins them. He needs to wait for the next minion wave before he can do anything. So just missing his timing just a little bit here, but then again, he had to push out that wave in bot.
Well, the only wave clear is currently enough wave clear if you are Origin. Lemon's been knocking on the outer turret door. Nobody is letting them get through. Again, Mythi, with those distortion boots already upgraded, trying to find an opportunity. Elements are not presenting one. You see Amazing pushing deep. The thing is, every time you look at the minimap, I feel like Origin are using their side waves more effectively. They've got a strong CS lead on Nils. Yes, JWoww still has a 30 CS advantage on Soaz. Soaz, 0-1-0. Got a Wardens, got a Cinder Hulk. He's starting already to get beefy.
The thing is here, Elements are allowing Origin to push out these side lanes, to get into the jungle for a few times and ward it. Tabs right now is sitting on over 2,000 gold on this Corki here. You see it there, 2,400 for himself. He goes back to shop now, so he's going to be very strong coming out of the base. And that's where Elements now have to turn on the power. They have to be able to groove on this mid tower, push it in. You have your bot lane now, that's easy to shove it back out with Tabs. Take one wave, take the next wave you see moving in from Elements towards, from Origin towards Elements now. Clear those two waves, and then group with the Azir in the mid lane. Origin has to send someone down to take the wave bot lane. That's your opening. Sivir alone should not be enough to stop double poke from taking down this mid tower. And then suddenly Elements, even out the turret for, gets a lead as well in terms of gold and can be ready for next dragon, where they once again they hit these spikes on Trinity Forces.
What I learned from the previous game, Fischio, was after 18 minutes of even gameplay, team that makes the more proactive decisions can win very rapidly. Unicorns of Love just rolled over Gambit once they hit those power spikes. And you can see Frog, Deathcap picked up with that Marilla Nomicon.
There's Tabs in the mid lane.
And there's Tabs with that Trinity Force and Sorcerer Shoes that you talked about. Let's see if Elements can find the team fight they're looking for to use their current strength as well as the bottom wave pushing.
Let's track the wave here. Tabs decided to build a big wave that can slowly push down towards Origin. They're already at the tower. Mythi's going in though.
Flash Tempest is going to hold Froggen in place. Emperor's Divide has not been used for the time being. It does, but Froggen is down. He has to fly the coop and return to base. Promise Q gets sucked dry as Xpekas Vladimir gets another kill. Two kills to Origin.
I really wish we could have waited just like 20 seconds because Elements needed that wave in the bot lane to be closer to the Origin tower, so someone had to go down and defend and clear that wave. Dexter getting stunned up should be able to tongue away, but because this wave is slowly building up and Elements already went aggressive in the mid lane, it allowed Origin to have all five members there and just instantly engage onto them, win the fight, push it back out. Suddenly the window is closing for Elements. They missed a chance here because they went too early suddenly. Almost feels weird to say. We just talk about how what they should do. Didn't wait for that wave. 5v5 in the mid lane with an Annie flashing in.
Oh, Mythi again.
It's great engage. I mean, he's running Distortion, he's building Talisman. He can do this time and time again. Origin is here. They win the fight. The siege was just about to be set up. They need it. 20, 30 seconds. And then you can start doing this. You need a wards on the flanks. They went there. Origin gets the fight they want. And we might just see them start really snowballing out of control now.
Well, we'll see if Origin can accelerate the game. Looking good. Pretty happy with the current performance. I'm getting very far ahead of myself to Fisher, but bear with me for a second, because both of these teams want to make it to playoffs. Both of these teams want to make it to Summer Split Finals, because neither of these teams have championship points. So if Elements or Origin want to make it to the World Championships, they have to either win the Summer Split, which is at the Hovet Arena in Stockholm. Tickets are still available, guys. Head over to lolesports.com. You can grab those up. And it starts with actually picking up wins in this game. Currently, Origin, they've dropped a few games, but they've got the makings of another victory under their belt.
Origin trying to start a Baron in case Elements and all five guys down to the Dragon. Step, Elements quickly react, secures that one for themselves. So nice little play there. Needs to go back and defend the mid lane, though. Origin once again is pushing in and winning that last team fight as well has opened up the jungle of Elements. It's been warded now by them. Let's see what Elements can do if they can catch someone from Origin. They need to start creating something with this Corki pick here.
We'll see how much pressure Origin apply on this top half of the map. They do have control around the pit. As you can see, not necessarily the strongest, you know, Baron numbers, but decent. However, I don't feel Origin's team composition will be sitting this side. With Sivir and the power of grouping Niels aside, can use that to their advantage. Elements, not out of this yet. 2,000 gold down. If they can find an engage that works, great. However, Deficio, they really, really, really just want to go for the pinata in the mid lane, but they're blindfolded. And Elements are swinging and swinging and missing and missing.
And now Mithy, Tippus is ready. He's going to have flash very soon with the distortion enchant. Let's see if he wants to just go for another engage, because once again, Origin have been allowed to control at least one side lane. The bot lane is slowly pushing for Elements, so they have to once again wait for it. But it's getting easier and easier for Origin to respond every single time. Source can even already sit down towards the bot lane. So he's bot now. Top lane, you see the Vladimir. If you ever have a chance to get that mid tower, it's right now for Elements.
All right. Rinse and repeat. I feel like we've seen this before.
Only three guys from Origin here this time, though.
Okay, flash is available for Mithy. Can he find the target? Doesn't even need to, because Niels is going to wave clear. So.
But then you got to commit.
Just again, siege in the middle lane. But it's not the most coordinated siege. Elements not using those side lanes effectively enough. We're not seeing CS numbers growing, really, on the side of Elements.
And that's the most annoying thing as a player, is when you have this play in mind, you know, okay, we have to do this. And one thing goes wrong because you just missed a part of it. And then you get super scared because you're like, oh, no, 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 no. We have to be careful now because Mithy is here. He can just flash Tippus again. So when they didn't have the chance to pull off the play, they're starting to doubt themselves, you know, feel like it's a bit too risky. And that really can slow down everything for these players here. Very tricky situation for Elements now. Dexter is going to be able to just jump away. But Origin, once again, they get time to go in, place up these deep wards here. They're now going to have pressure on this Baron. They might be able to force a 5-on-5 teamfight where you pop that Sivir ulti in the river. Open area where you can really use that mobility so well, and where Mithy gets a chance to flash in with the Tippus. That's going to be so key. I'm looking at Mithy in every single teamfight here. If he can get on to Taps or Froggen and kill one of these big damage dealers for Elements at the moment, Origin is going to win the fight.
And interesting to note, Niels has gone for that Phantom Dancer as opposed to the Shift, despite the importance of wave clear on his side. However, Elements only really have Corki and Azir to try get those turrets down. It's going to be in range, but this is going to be the fight. There was a Tippus that come down. I don't think that connected with anybody. Dexter has been attached to Chum the Waters, and he's flashed into safety. Hemoplague is going to split up Elements, as promised you, will get taken out. We do see the pop from the Hemoplague, the Ice Blast from Amazing. Absolute Zero to secure the kill, and two more members of Elements are down to the Origin team fights.
The same again here for Origin. They managed to get five players together. Tibbers onto Froggen, forced his Baron, then he dashed away from that one. But as long as Origin can just pop that Sivir ulti and fight out in the open, it's working really well for them. Let's see what happens near the Baron here. taps, and wow! J-Wild going in.
That's a lot of damage from J-Wild. He may get Niels. Niels is forced to flash to safety. He comes back in with the cheeky auto attack for the kill. Emperor's Divide will split the team fight, but Froggen will only get one before being taken down himself. Elements crucially interrupt the Baron.
Managed to stop that one. Two more kills though for Origin. A heading goal. Elements are back towards the mid lane. Tap needs to go back soon though. He's running very low. Let's see how much gold he's sitting on this time. Because last time he had 2,500. 1,700 build up for him now. Go towards. Depending obviously on what he wants here. If he wants to play extra safe, go for the BT. If you want the maximum damage, you want the Infinity Edge. But against the Nunu and the Fizz, going Blade of the Rune King is also a very viable option for him.
Well, you're talking about items to fish here. Myth has picked Mithy, has picked himself up a Quicksilver Sash already. The only real threat being, of course, some of those dark bindings. As long as he can engage, it'll be great. We'll talk about that in a moment. This is J-Wild's damage onto Niels.
It is a Trinity Force Hecarim. We mentioned how strong Elements could be here in this mid game. But they never managed to get the coordination down because it's always Origin in control of when the fights are starting through Mithy and through how Elements are trying to set up the place and missing just one or two things every single time. And then they get surprised by Origin flashing in, getting onto a carry. So we never got to see what J-Wild could do before now, and now he was left almost on his own.
But it does still show you, if J-Wild can get behind, if he can find Niels, there is the potential to at least remove one of those damage threats. Fizz is building Uber Mega Ultra Tank. Even Peke has gone fairly tanky. He's gone for Spirit Visage, as well as Wota and then Void Staff. So, truthfully, if you drop Niels early, there is a chance for Elements to win a team fight. We do have an answer to the question. Tabs is going towards that Blade of the Rune King as his second out.
Very standard when you're against two tanks, even though obviously Swords is not. Oh, sorry, amazing at this point, not this tank. How many tanky stats? He has to lock it, he's gonna get a lot of HP. So
they're gonna get the tower. No?
No.
No,
no, no
minions,
come back.
No minions. I got too excited.
If this tower doesn't go down this game, it's the MVP. That one tower. Because everything so far has been around that one tower.
Oh, Elements.
It's just bait right now.
It is. Kind of feels a little bit like 300. Elements trying to siege and break the Spartan army, but King Leonidas Niels holding strong. This time round, Origin do have that northern position in the river. No teleport from Soez, so he's not in the side lane. J-Wild does have teleport. It looks like Origin are saying, call our bluff. We'll be on Baron. You decide where you want to go. There's the teleport from J-Wild. Origin have forced Elements' hand. And J-Wild's now joined. Is it going down?
It's open now. Elements, good job here spotting Dexter. He doesn't even want the minions. He's just take down that tower. There we go. 28 minutes in. And now we can get baited by the tier 2 tower.
Let's see. With their outer turret down, Elements may decide to play around the jungle. Before they can, they have to deal with, again, the threat of Baron. It's not the fastest Baron team from Origin, though.
Origin just wants a chance to pop that ulti from Niels and then a flash tables from Mithy. Out in the open here, we keep talking about it, but Elements are staying so far back and just poking them really, really well. So they punish Origin for it and they get better position around the mid lane to push down for another tower. Origin going back to Baron instead. Elements probably gonna go back to stop them after taking down this tower.
You read the situation incorrectly. The bait was Baron, not the tower. This time around, it's down to 2,500. Elements may be too late to this one. Origin secure it. They do pop on the hunt. Mithy's looking for the stun. He finds it onto Promiscue before the Black Shield can come out. Didn't see if it had been used already, and it's Soaz that picks up the kill credit. But look at the base! Super minions will be pouring through soon. It looks like Elements are going to trade a Baron for an inhibitor. Let's flash over there. It looks like Peck has thrown down the Hemo Plague as Niels and Amazing are coming up from behind. Hemo Plague pops, and Froggen gets popped in reply. Elements lose three in Baron, but gain supers in middle.
But look at the top lane here. They're going to lose even more. Mithy's going to get a kill as well.
He finds one onto Tabs. This is devastating for Elements. As J-Wild throws down the Onslaught of Shadows, he's got a Brambleback and a Yeti on his back. Amazing is trying to be a nuisance and prevent J-Wild getting into the base. Soaz has killed an inhibitor turret. Amazing smites for the heal, and he's still keeping J-Wild busy. Yeti's greater than horses, or so we're learning. Consume again for the HP. Jaywell finally wins the trade, but at what cost? Soez is now trying to get the inhibitor. He should be able to secure it. Going to urchin strike through to dodge the dark binding. And after the dust has settled, Super's top, Super's middle, but Baron Foraging.
So Element's feeling it was worth it for them to try and trade an inhibitor and then give away that Baron to Origin. Didn't move back to try and stop it, only sent three guys over there. In the end, the Origin gets some kills. Promise Guru got caught out, and then they get the kills on to Froggen and Taps, who just needed like a few more seconds before it maybe have made it out. And that results in Origin getting a top inhibitor, so definitely winning out on the trade. But Element's feeling that they maybe it was too risky for them to go in and try and take that fight, or maybe they just thought they could get down this inhibitor, back out in time, say, okay, you get the Baron, but we got towers, we open up your base instead, and you don't want to keep dancing around this objective, just waiting for Mythi to flash in with that Tipras.
Yeah, there's no teleport in either top laner, and multiple lanes of super minions. Kinda have to think this is gonna be a slower pace. Origin with the wave clear advantage of Sivir, may be able to work out. Oh, Dark Binding goes wide. Promise Q does not manage to connect. Origin shove out that middle lane and then instantly onto this bottom turret. This will be tower number 7. Origin don't care that their super's pushing towards them because they've got the Baron. They've got the pressure advantage.
We might just see Origin try and go for a dive, honestly. If they get onto a key target, you can just try and instantly assassinate them. You have Pekka as well going. Source is just jumping straight in and then back out. Look for Mythi once again, though.
No flash this time. Let's have that ancient point. Talisman of Ascension. With a lot of wave clear from Froggen and Corki, played by Tabs, to deal with. Origin's minion waves, even with Baron Empowered, is getting killed very, very quickly.
Yeah, that's why, again, with the fact that Origin is grouping all five on this bottom, they're obviously waiting for the super minion top lane to push in, but also just give them that option. Here's the dive.
Well, there's the dive. Emperor's Device is going to split them up. Chamber Waters connects onto Jaywell, but Pekka and Niels forced to back away. Hemoplague has now been used. We see Froggen's barrier, his wall is down. Niels takes a couple extra hits. Super minions are in the middle of the base. Origin tried to use the pressure to their advantage, held Element's back, but they need to recall to deal with those supers.
Got to see if they can just get a quick pick here, then get another tower down while Element also had to go back and deal with the super minions. Instead, they play it safe, they back away. Get to kind of reset the map a little bit. Dexter, maybe looking for that red buff. Mason was cheating a little bit before in that one-on-one. Dexter now wants revenge against the red buff. Or not?
Not this time around. Vision for Dragon, which is up in 20 seconds. Element's got one, Origin got three. Now the game is slowed down just a hair. Element's are 7,000 gold down.
Oh, it's just a small one left anyway.
Just the baby one. It was picked up by Jaywell, I think. So Dragon is now spawned. We do see Niels is going to spot them out with that scrying lens, scrying orb. Home God, teleports, Jaywell. Where can he go? He's channeling it. He's coming in from the Wraith Camp. That's what Dexter was doing. Onslaught of Shadows is still on hold. Jaywell doesn't need it. They've lost Promise Q, but Niels is down. Froggen's got himself a kill as well. Two members of Origin are down and they're on the retreat. Pekka trying to transfuse himself away. He survives. 2-for-1, supers on Element's base. Means they need to back as well.
Really like that Dragon setup though. We were joking around with Dexter. He's going for that red buff, but he placed a few D wards, allowed Jaywell to get a good flank in against Origin. Get a Dragon. It's only the second one of the game for them though, so the Dragon won't really be the big deal for now. It's more the fact that Baron is respawning in 2 minutes time. Origin used it as a tool to try and force a fight out in the open. Element said, nope, we don't even want to go for it. We're just going to try and take your inhibitor instead. End up backfiring for Element as they lost their own on the top side. I want to see what they do this time around. Obviously, you don't have the same amount of the same kind of power spike as you had in the mid game, where you didn't really manage to gain any advantage. And we also have a pause.
Thanks, Captain.
There you go.
What we did see, though, was just how important Niels is to Origin's team fights. When Jaywell finds him and insta-gibs him, all of a sudden, Origin loses a very big chunk of the damage. Look at the items here. Yes, Fizz is great in the back line, but Soez doesn't have a lot of damage. Pekka is, as we've already highlighted, gone quite tanky, really. Oh, God. Spirit Visage. A lot of weight on Niels' shoulders. I mean, it's paid off so far. Let's also be honest.
Yeah, it's a strategy we have seen before from Origin. I mean, Niels has been absolutely fantastic this split here. Yesterday against Fnatic, he was the only guy who had any kills. All six of them for the team. So he's been in a position before where he is the main damage dealer. He didn't even get to use Flash in the last fight. Hecarim came in, I think he got blinded after, just got completely destroyed. That pause was just a bait.
Well, we are back in game. Last match of the week here in week four. Elements find themselves 2 wins and 5 losses on the split. In the next week, we will breach that halfway mark. We'll start having rematches. We'll start seeing who's gonna really start stepping up. There's a replay of this previous fight. Keep your eyes on JWoww and then Niels.
Yeah, so Niels basically just gets locked up instantly, doesn't have a chance at all dealing damage or flashing out. Meaning that Elements win the fight. Taker gets out in the end, but then Dragon gets picked up by Elements, and really just a good setup at first from Dexter with the deep ward. And then we'll still see, even though Homeguard has been nerfed a little bit on Hecarim, he can still be very powerful just as a surprise factor, as a flank to get in there. JWoww honestly had a pretty good game. Whenever he's been needed to do anything, he's been there.
Definitely been the case. It just feels like Element as a team necessarily been in the right place at the right time. We've seen both inhibitors respawn. And despite Origin still holding on to a sizable gold, it's obviously becoming slightly less effective the longer this game goes. More frequent Elements can find an engage. JWoww has been caught out. Mithy puts down the stun. Froggen is trying to wave clear. Take a look at the bottom. Soez is pushing out that bottom lane. He's onto the inhibitor. There's the Shurima shuffle, and they've caught Xpricket. He Sanguine pulls underneath Elements, but the onslaught of shadows from JWoww jumps into the back line. Elements are deciding they don't want this fight. Soez has got himself a tower, and Elements going to back out. Nobody goes down in the fight, but that was close. Here's Soez, teleported to mid lane. He's found Tabs. Chum the Waters connects. Dexter's gonna at least knock him up. Tabs is trying to lifesteal, and he should be able to survive for the moment. Is gonna get taken out. Challenging Smite was enough. The hop and the skip from Soez lands on Dexter's head, and he's forced to retreat. Dexter will be going down. Origin get themselves another tower and 2 more kills on the retreat from Elements.
Yeah, Soez split pushing there. Only 4 members from Origin, and still they managed to get such a good team fight. Froggen, he pushed back Peke, who just instantly pulled, stayed alive. There's no damage really to be dealt on Origin. They win the fight. They get so much on the map again. Baron, another tower, 2 inhibitors exposed now from Elements. Niels, 4 items completed on his Sivir. And Anunu, of course, buffing him up.
Very, very scary Sivir. But if you step back and look at this entire game, it can be summarized by looking at how many members Origin have pushing top or bottom lane. The entirety of this match, somebody has been dealing with those lanes to keep Elements defending, to keep Elements with their backs against the wall, and it's paying off. Origin got the tower lead, they've got the map lead, they've got farm leads, they're in a great position.
And then also just Origin being able to predict what Elements were going to do. So whenever Elements were grouping in the mid lane, Origin were already sitting ready with like 3, 4, 5 members, and they instantly went for the fight. They didn't give Elements a chance to start grouping because, you know, there was a mistake with the minion wave, there's no wards on the flanks, and that gave Origin the chance to go for these engages here and be ready for them. And that just allowed them to survive the mid game at first, get these team fights out in the open with the Sivir ulti. Peke has done a good job in team fights as well. By building a bit tanky, still has a lot of damage.
Yeah, working with his team very effectively. Hourglass picked up, so gonna survive even more. And with those Baron empowered minions, we saw the graphic a little while ago, the Fisher, that Origin has secured 6 Barons in their previous games. They've picked up 2 this game alone. 25% of their total number already. Let's see what they can take with this one. 2/3 of the timer has run through. Origin gonna use this last couple of waves to try and take another inhibitor. See if they can. Peke trying to zone. JWoww teleporting in from behind. On the Hunt has come out. Can Elements find the target? Niels, he's got caught out. He's down. Elements have got the main damage dealer. They're focusing on Peke. But the retreating Origin will stay alive for the time being. And they do get themselves a kill on Dexter. I think that was the Hemoplague pop that did it. 1 for 1. Origin got the inhibitor. Very important. Pressure still on Elements.
Every single time J.O. has that teleport ready, Origin is pushing up and he gets a chance to flank. He gets on to Nils. Another time when Nils didn't get to flash, just ends up dying instantly. Damage goes. That caught me a little bit off guard.
That's yeah, that actually scared me.
We got some good sound effects here. I want to look more tapped when he's flying around.
Observe, you have your mission. You may not be able to do it. Froggen. For his soldiers to arise. Those taps coming up from the river. Elements dealing with a minion wave, but Soaz, no teleport up top. Origin gonna be a little careful. They're playing very deep in enemy territory.
Yeah, you need your AD carry here. Five guys from Elements around them. If they realize Nils is not there, they might just look straight for a fight, but it seems like they're all just recalling, going back to base, gonna now stand face to face.
Maybe Origin expected the dragon to be the focus for Elements. And Elements opted to leave that one thanks to the wards. They can drag this out. JWoww will have teleport in a couple of minutes' time. It's the only way back into this, I feel, for Elements. Teleporting onto Nils to turn more towers or get supers or a baron, something important.
That won't happen for a few minutes. I think Elements is going to be a little bit annoyed they didn't realize Nils was there or didn't see an opening at least to start a fight. They had the ulti ready from JWoww when Origin were pushing up. Obviously nothing, no Sivir ulti. I mean, there's a righteous glory for Promise Q, so they will be able to add some abilities with four dragons now for Fnatic.
Six
for
Origin. Minutes.
Fnatic.
Wow.
For Peck and Soaz.
You're going back Origin. In time, Deficio. Back in time indeed.
I mean,
it's because it's Peck and Froggen.
Yeah, I called them top laners earlier, now I'm calling Origin for Fnatic.
Couple weeks off, and your mind just goes to mush. But we did see that dragon going down, that 6 minute timer for the five dragon buff. Can Origin secure it? They've not been able to this split. With memory serves, nobody's been able to get Aspect of the Dragon in Summer so far. I'm sure somebody from Stats will help confirm or deny that for me. But we do see this inhibitor will be falling down. Elements deciding not to engage. Soaz takes a little bit of poke, but now there's super minions in the top lane to deal with as well. Elements playing it safe. Peck is going to get caught out. Empress Divide will get dodged away by that Sanguine pool. A little bit of awkwardness across the board as Elements trying to hold on. JWoww is getting chunked as Nils is shredding his HP. Does not get one more magical critical hit.
Mid tower as well now.
Will secure the tower and potentially the third inhibitor. League of Legends by the numbers. Origin getting all the objectives.
So everything open. Origin doesn't have to take any chances now. Spend the goal you have. Wait for all these super minions to start pushing in. You even have a Baron coming in 1.5 minutes, but when you have three lanes of super minions, you want to get into that phase of Elements. You want to just put pressure on them. Because they're obviously forced to deal in with all these minions. They're going to get poked from it. Mythi has Banner of Command, one of my favorite items. I love it. Buff up one of your minions. Even the AP can be useful.
Nils going for Blade of the Rune King as his fifth item. All in. Why not?
You consider the fact that the only way he's been dying is if he gets locked down CC-wise for either the Spear or the Binding. Could have gone in for a Q as this for Nils. It's like, again, he's killed twice now where he got flank, he didn't get to flash out or anything. He just went up. He ended up going down instantly. Decides he wants more damage though. Try and deal some of the tanks from Elements.
Elements trying to push forward and deal with some supers before he gets into the base, but top lane is going to catch them out. Elements now have to also deal with this empowered minion from the Banner of Command. Soaz shoving bottom. He has teleport available. Elements forced to retreat. They simply cannot risk being outside of their base with double super minions in three lanes. If Origin play patiently, this is their ticket to another victory.
Nils' teleport is up in just a few seconds. He's already back in base. Is there any wards behind? There's one down here near the Wolf Camp. Fairly far away though from the rest of Origin, but it might be the one he's in. Boy, just comes straight from the base. Time to dive in.
Inhibitor, one more love tap is all that it will take. Peck is on the front line. Look at the hit onto JWoww. Nils with that Bloodthirster shield. still able to chunk down. Froggen gonna be using that passive, but
first tower.
He calls up a tower as Elements lose a tower. Origin continue the siege. Look at the minions, they're pouring through top. Inhibitor is gonna drop. Feels like just a matter of time now. Origin should be able to just throw down on the hunt to try focus the tower. Soez eats a dark binding. There's on the hunt and the Tibbers. Pekka comes in. That's Jaywell going on the Onslaught of Shadows. Tabs is deleted as Miffy gives his life for Origin to set their sights on the Nexus. Origin will be losing three members as Pekka and Froggen trading on the fountain. Froggen gets himself a triple kill, but look at all the super minions. Amazing's gonna
come
try
on,
to
Amazing.
Defend this.
Can you're the Nunu.
There should be enough. Oh, Froggen goes in for the quadra kill.
Ah, the Nunu.
And
wow.
Origin.
Super minions.
Look at that face palm from Amazing. Froggen's got a fair amount of AoE, but it may not be enough. He's trying to defend. This is PvE, League of Legends. Bird is the word.
He needs the minions to respawn.
He's looking for minions, but it's going to stay alive a few seconds longer. This next
this is what Froggen does best,
I
by the way.
Never shall casted a player versus minions. And the minions are not with Origin yet.
Wait and see, more super minions are coming though, but Froggen got his own minion spawn just to buy some more time.
I have no experience shout casting, farming. This is I agree with picture
and picture.
Picture's
alive.
Elements live to fight one more day!
Before that farm, Froggen would go back and upgrade his QSS. Get some AD as well for himself. Three waves of super minions coming down. One guy left alive. Amazing on Nunu was standing there, ended up dying instantly.
Deficio, you can take members of Fnatic out of Fnatic, but unkillable Nexuses, you cannot take out of Fnatic members.
Froggen farming like a monster.
Pekka and Soez have felt this pain many times before. Six Barons in their previous games. This will be the third in one game. Half of all Barons secured leading up to this point, Origin have secured, and 10 seconds till Dragon. Elements, can you stop Dragon? I say no.
Teleport is ready. We need one insane team fight. I mean, they've won fights before, despite being behind. But they get to Nils. He has no flash. TP is up for Jaywell, but it's going to be five dragons and a Baron and inhibitors down. Like, again, technically, it's impossible.
A Baron, however, Baron buff aspect of the dragon team with no Nexus turrets and with only one exposed inhibitor. I mean, the odds are astronomically stacked against Elements.
Thank you.
Mercurial Scimitar has been sold for
yeah,
a Guardian Angel.
A little bit disappointed.
Froggen's got a lot of toys to play with. Needs that extra life.
Pretty. And also quite like the QSS against Mythi's Splash Tibbers, huh? Guardian Angel instead of Froggen. So two inhibitors now respawned. Giving a little bit more breathing room for Elements, but then a Baron buff, five dragon, and Origin comes in and doesn't really count for too much.
There are so many particles.
Oh! Wow.
So many particles on Nils. One boomerang blade, chunked down Froggen there. No armor to speak of outside of that hourglass. He's sticking around though. He's going in for the Shurima shuffle. He's split Origin.
Up,
but Froggen's going to be low. Jowell's coming, but the fight may already be over. He's jumped onto Nils. He's dashed back out of the fight. Promiscue, Tabs, Dexter, Froggen, they are all down. Origin are looking to win themselves another game with the first aspect of the dragon with three Barons. And with every single tower down, Origin close out the game. I'm almost as relieved as they are.
Yeah. I mean, there's so many different... so many things to talk about in this game here. Like, from the start of Origin, punishing Elements for missing just a few key things every time they were trying to set up a play. Very clear on the map what their mistakes were and what happened. And then here in the end we need 5 Dragons, Baron, 3 Inhibitors down before the fight events. And even the last team fight, they've been so good with the JWoww TPs in for the flank. Then the last one, it came in late. Elements lost the fight. I mean, let's be fair, they probably lost the fight. Anyway, how buffed up Origin was, but fun ending. I mean, it's cool to see Frog and defend the next.
It was a fun game to watch, that is for sure. And I think for Elements, it was a little bit of progression. It was good to see him being a little bit more proactive. They were trying, however, all of the other things were lacking. The side lanes, the timing.
This is one of the games, though, where you go back and you rewatch it, and you instantly realize, oh, that was a mistake. That was a mistake. We need to fix these two parts. And then our overall game plan was there. It was okay. But we were just lacking this and this. And it's very clear when they rewatch the game, like, oh, we didn't have the side wave pushing, or it wasn't pushed down far enough, and we didn't have wards on the flank. So we allowed Origin to get that engage. So I feel like that's a thing for Elements here.